If I could sum up the year with three words, they'd probably be recession-proof. Ha! It's been a turbulent year for the industry, with most companies considered to be doing pretty fucking well if they only had to fire one busload of employees, and a large number of big releases being pushed back to Q1 2010 and leaving me with a disappointing list of squeaky farts and the occasional trumpeting biffer that I now have to pick awards out for. So here we go. Incidentally, I still couldn't be asked to make actual physical awards for these, so if you own one of the winners, just draw a little cock on the box with Tippex or something. Sandboxes really have become the iPhone of gameplay mechanics, formerly the choice of trend-following douchebags, but now not having one makes you the poor kid from school who has to wear his dad's old pants with the legs cut off. But like the Greater London One-Way system, a trend followed mindlessly can lead to all sorts of problems. A lot of games do need the freedom of their sandboxes. Infamous has its city-fixing mechanic, Prototype is just a great big murder activity centre, but in some games the sandbox is little more than a gameplay padding apron for a knowingly flimsy story campaign to hide behind. Brutal Legend, for example, was a game that seemed to use sandboxing to avoid having to come out as an RTS game to its disapproving dad. But the winner of this award is first-person Nazi map Wolfenstein. Good sandboxing is composed firstly of freedom, and there's little freedom in first-person when you go around wearing blinkers and turning as fast as a fucking merry-go-round, and secondly of exploration, and why would you want to explore when you already know you're just gonna find more Nazis? The biggest dead end award is for new innovations in technology that really isn't getting us anywhere, like an experimental Bread's helicopter with baguettes for propellers. DJ Hero this year made a wonderfully concerted effort to murder the entire rhythm genre with a controller designed for people who want to give themselves carpal tunnel syndrome, but I'm inclined to give this award preemptively to Microsoft's Project Natal. As long as there's no physical feedback, motion sensor controls aren't just a dead end, they're a dead end full of spiders and your mum standing at the back saying you'll never amount to anything. Shigeru Miyamoto said as much at E3, which makes me wonder what bucket he had on his head when the Wii was getting specced out. But he meant it as a dig at Natal, which apparently thinks that what the iToy was missing was an undercurrent of paedophilia. In an industry where sequels come down like the fucking autumn rain, new intellectual property should be encouraged as they make their first wobbling steps towards their first sellout, but that doesn't mean they should get complacent, so the complete non-starter award is for new IPs that brain themselves on the hospital floor the instant they slithered from the womb. And the clear winner, by a unanimous vote of one, is Wet. If it had just had a main character who was as appealing as a crying baby that's been strapped to the side of your head, that might have been enough, but the gameplay was also like putting all the worst ideas in the world in a smoothie maker and drinking the result from a pouch made from a hollowed out ball sack. Soundtrack was alright though. After Super Mario Bros. Wii was just an NES Mario game with four times the bullshit, I was tempted to give this award to Mario, but frankly it's a little too obvious, and complaining about Mario's undying nature is like using a shield and claymore to take on a speeding train. So instead I'm giving it to Michael Atkinson, the South Australian Attorney General who continues to ensure that half the games get banned or censored, and whose ancient, black, dried up little heart still manfully strives to keep him alive in the face of the searing waves of hatred that are broadcast to him from all over the nation and the world every second of every day. Well done, you miserable old fuck. ...2009's Razor Blade Filled Vagina Award for Most Tortured Analogy remembers the Resident Evil series, which sadly passed away this year. After a first installment considered by some to be a classic, but by me to be rubbish, the series circled the drain for a few sequels with a wonkily controlled zombie shooting in various fixed camera environments, full of tedious puzzles based around unlocking doors with objects from the trophy cabinet. Then suddenly Resident Evil 4 demonstrated how to get a good game out of the series, completely change the gameplay and make the story about something mostly unrelated. Sort of makes you wonder why they even called it Resident Evil 4, rather than, say, Captain Ponty Hair vs. Continental Europe. But anyway, 2009's Resident Evil 5 got a bit too cocky and tried to force the entire series backstory down the throats of its new audience, and the result was some inbred backwater child with a lung growing out of its back and racism instead of legs. The most obvious candidate for Game of the Year would be the absolutely spellbinding Duke Nukem Forever, but I am sadly forced to disqualify it because it was so incredibly good that it caused some kind of quantum collapse that erased it from existence and from the memories of the human race. Besides that, 2009 didn't really have a Saints Row 2, that is, a game I can call really good without having to qualify the statement, but since I'm forced to pick from the thalidomide babies, Batman Arkham Asylum was probably the one with the least birth defects. Despite Batman walking pompously around like Gotham City's grumpy dad and dialogue that presumably came free with the script writing software, Arkham Asylum successfully balanced combat and stealth and managed to do the impossible by giving the comic book nerd something they wouldn't be able to complain about. And so the 2000Xs are left behind as we look ahead to the 2000XDXs. Perhaps this will finally help us feel like we're actually living in the future rather than a psychotically grim corporate apocalypse where an iPhone has a net worth significantly higher than a human life. Happy New Year. I have a lot of respect for the Fantasy Peasant Village economic model. It seems like those guys have got a good scam going on. First you accidentally build your settlement within easy walking distance of the local Gnoll encampment or Dragon Cave or directly on top of a gateway to hell. Then all you have to do is build a big fat checkpoint in the village square and keep giving birth to potential kidnap victims, and and your storekeeper, your blacksmith, your tailor, and your innkeeper, they'll all be set for fucking life. Okay, someone's pretty daughter gets dragged off by kobolds every other night, but hey, you've cornered the lucrative adventurer market, just buy another one. I bet this is why NPCs in RPG peasant villages never move from a single spot directly in front of their place of business. If they move, all the adventurer money in their pockets will pull their trousers down. Presumably they pay a helper gnome to come along every morning to shovel breakfast cereal into their mouths. Torchlight is an action RPG in which you play one of three adventurers who arrives at a small town that went for the build directly on top of Satan option, and there you embark on an epic quest to keep the town economy stimulated. And you have to go hunt down an evil wizard as well, I think. No one in the town seems to be that bothered by him, but as long as you're the one with the big sword running around buying souvenir t-shirts, you can do what the fuck you like, I guess. The graphical style owes a lot to World of Warcraft, but while World of Warcraft continually expands the standard array of character classes into one huge mess that's about as easy to keep balanced as a stilt walker with one leg on a treadmill, Torchlight takes the Dragon Age route of boiling them down back to the big three. The warrior, the melee class looking strongly like Ving Rhames, the alchemist, the skinny white dude who fills the role of mage, warlock, shaman, and everything else where you don't actually have to do any physical work, and a pair of big titties filling in for the rogue. And since this is a fantasy game, big titties apparently do the exact opposite of what they do in the real world, that is, they make you more dexterous and skilled in the use of bows and long-range weapons without even smacking you across the chops every time you pull the string back. Character customization is extremely intuitive. There isn't any. So unless you happen to be Ving Rhames, don't expect to roleplay much. Torchlight is a Steam game currently exclusive to PC, and I wouldn't hold your breath for a console port. It would lose a lot of the atmosphere of the original, since you wouldn't be able to hear your mouse button clicking about 50 times a second. This is something the game has in common with Diablo, along with absolutely fucking everything else. You click around town, click your way into some quests, click down to the dungeons, click all the enemies to death, and then click back home again. There's more clicks than a school for dolphin telegraph operators. You'd think clicking on an enemy would indicate you want to smack them about until they die, but your character assumes you want to give them a chance to say they're sorry, and you have to click again for each smack. A bad habit I assumed had been bred out of RPGs. The other reason why you probably won't see a console port is because we'd need to wait for a console with 50 buttons and a controller the size of a tea tray. With all the number keys assigned to different skills and having to switch between two functions for each mouse button, the controls aren't exactly streamlined. At one point I accidentally pressed a button that made the map fill the whole screen, and I actually had to wait for one of the fucking loading screen hints to tell me how to get rid of it. At first I played as a warrior on normal difficulty, and the first thing I discovered is that Torchlight is big on hordes. Large numbers of enemies tend to gather around you, each picking at your Ving Rhames shaped arse like a swarm of guinea pigs wielding toothpicks. Fortunately, by the end of the first dungeon I had a couple of clearing attacks that sent the guinea pigs flying like a little furry firework. Holy shit, I exclaimed, I am so fucking bored! And I haven't used a single health potion despite having collected 37. Apparently Torchlight interprets normal difficulty as normal for someone who has spent most of their life chained to a basement wall. So I restarted as an alchemist on hard difficulty. Perhaps the guinea pigs would pose a greater challenge to my skinny white scholarly body. I imagine they would have done if they'd been able to get near it, but my area of effect spells and summoned minions kept them at bay. 10 hours later, I'd sold about 20 times as many health potions as I'd actually used, and acquired a spell called Giant Laser Beam Face Melty Death that gave the enemies even less of a chance. It did eat up mana like nobody's business, but I was practically brushing my teeth with mana potion at that stage. There was one thing that gave me difficulty, for want of a better, more profane word, and that's NPC pathfinding. Perhaps this is another reason why most of the NPCs spend their whole life standing perfectly still, because they get easily confused by any movement more complex than walking in a straight line. My class choice meant I had a constant entourage of imps and robots, and I lost count of how many times I'd emerged from an unusually difficult battle to find that half my assistants were 50 feet back attempting to navigate their way through a foot-high wall. Besides them, every character gets either a dog or a cat, in another testament to the phrase spoiled for choice, whose job is to hold spare armor and weapons and take them to the service to sell them for you to the surprisingly unconcerned shopkeepers. And it doesn't take long to realize how necessary this is. Monsters constantly drop equipment, most of which needs to be identified in the most egregious example of needless busy work, and the vast majority is unusable or worse than what you already have, so it gets filed under dog, like you're playing Fantasy Buckaroo. It turns the gameplay into one part action to two parts accounting. Torchlight attended the two human school of level design, make about three rooms for each setting, throw in a few modest hordes, then copy-paste them until your processor melts. Overall then, the experience is like sawing a bunch of logs with overclocked power tools, so the actual sawing is blisteringly easy, but you have to stop every 10 seconds to sweep up the sawdust. But then again, I did only pay $3 for it over the Steam sale, so I guess the question is, did I have an amount of fun equal to or greater than I would have had if I'd just used the money to buy an ice cream sandwich? And the answer is definitely, as long as the ice cream sandwich was first buried at the bottom of a gravel pit and I have to eat it with a drinking straw. Well, bugger my bumblebee's bread bin. The first few weeks of 2010 are going to be fun, aren't they? Darksiders, Bayonetta, Dante's Inferno, and God of War 3. God of War ripoff, God of War ripoff, God of War ripoff, and God of War... well, God of War. God of War knows how I'm going to keep all four of these reviews interesting, unless maybe I wore increasingly elaborate hats with each one. What is it with this time of year that's made game developers so angry at mythological creatures? Oh, wait a minute, Christmas. Oh, I see. Did Santa bring you your pink slips this year, and now you're taking it out on all his mates? Anyway, I got my hands on Darksiders first, and to begin what I feel will be a trend of overusing the phrase like God of War, but Darksiders is like God of War, but concerning the biblical apocalypse. Not that they want to admit it, the story skirts coyly around depicting anything as offensive as God and Satan having a punch-up in a pub car park, instead referring obliquely to a creator and a destroyer. The main character is one of the horsemen of the apocalypse, and considering the gameplay style, it should be fairly obvious which one. Death would make things too easy, famine's a little too gradual, and what the fuck's pestilence gonna do? Cough on people. Anyway, something that strongly resembles the apocalypse happens. War gets a bit overexcited and comes down to earth to stomp on everyone, but wait, where are the other three horsemen? Oh no, turns out this isn't officially the apocalypse, it's just some other unrelated conflict between angels and demons that results in total human extinction. Apparently the right paperwork wasn't filed, so War's bosses get very cross at him, take away his powers and send him back to act as some kind of cosmic repo man and kick all the angels and demons off the planet until they can fill the proper forms in. Presumably Darksiders refers to the demons, but they never get referred to as that in-game, so it's a pretty weak title overall. If only there were a better name for a game about a supernatural embodiment of armed conflict. Okay, I'm done with that. Besides the central concept, Darksiders doesn't actually rip that much off from God of War. In many ways, I wish it had. God of War had decent combat, for one thing. Here are the combos you will need to know to master Darksiders. The Chump Chop, square. The Double Chump Chop, square, square. And the Whipped Cream Genocide Brouhaha, square, square, square. If you're an advanced student, remember to also hit the dodge button whenever a nearby enemy produces a megaphone and yells, "Hello, this is me telegraphing my attack. Are you ready? Here it comes now." There's only one attack button at first. You get another one when you get your first secondary weapon, but there are no combos that use both buttons. All you can do is wail on the enemies like you're mining for silver in their nasal cavities, and it gets really boring really fast. The first boss fight is the hardest in the game, but by the end you've got 6 more life bars, and hopefully you've bought the dashing stab attack that is to the entire combat system what Yoko Ono was to the Beatles, so the final boss is piss easy. Who mapped this curve out? Jackson Pollock? But to be fair, there's also a fairly strong emphasis on puzzles. Just because War is the personification of violence doesn't mean that violence is all he's about. Oh wait, yes it does! You may have heard in the grown-up reviews that this aspect of Darksiders borrows rather heavily from that one Zelda game Nintendo have been constantly remaking since 1987. I don't think that's the case though. I think saying Darksiders borrows heavily implies they did some actual work of their own. A better phrase would be completely rips off with about as much shame and emotion as the fucking Borg Collective. I appreciate that taking elements from a good game that worked well and playing around with them in new scenarios isn't a bad way to design games, but when you have a boomerang that can hit multiple targets, a grappling hook that pulls you onto climbable walls, and a puzzle dungeon themed around reflecting a beam of light with movable mirrors, we've moved from simple homage to the territory of respraying a stolen car and reselling it to the owner. Thankfully, the last dungeon introduces one gadget that has never been in a Zelda game, a gun that opens blue and orange portals. Outstanding. Maybe Darksiders can't help it, like it's got kleptomania or something. In that case, I don't know whether to make fun of it or have it sectioned. For a game that has you collect souls all the time, that's blue souls, not red souls. This is not God of War, this is completely different. Darksiders doesn't really have a soul of its own. It seems like what you'd get if some pale man in a business suit threw a pile of random popular games from the last 5 years to the development team and ordered them to Frankenstein them together into something that's guaranteed to sell. All these macho and smiling warriors chopping the legs off giant spiders with swords the size of aircraft carriers, this is a 14-year-old's idea of masculinity. War has absolutely no personality. He's a great big brick that gets in fights, going about things with an air of cold, angsty dispassion. He doesn't seem to give a toss about anything he does, so why should I? And what right does War have to be angsty about his life? He's fucking War. He's never had to queue up at the job centre or pine after ex-girlfriends who left him for a surfer. He just breaks things. If I were War and I'd just hoisted a 7-foot demon into the air and chopped him in half with a single swing, I wouldn't stand there scowling. I'd go, "Fucking hell, did anyone see that? I am squirting machismo out of my nipples over here. I am a monster truck that walks like a man." But what butters my crampons the most is the character design. The main character looks like someone sat down, started drawing him, and then never fucking stopped. You know when you play World of Warcraft, you pick up a pair of boots here and some shoulder armor there, constantly switching out every piece for more effective ones until by the end of it your outfit's so mismatched you look like you put on a magnetic leotard and fell into a saucepan cupboard? Well, that's the look War has going on. Who the fuck thinks this looks cool, besides the gelatinous creatures who like Warhammer 40k? A plain black shirt looks cool, a blazer and tie looks cool, what War looks like is a fucking coral reef on legs. In games, when characters can often be quite distant and in constant motion, their designs need to be simple enough that the player can tell what they are and what they're about at a glance, but everyone in Darksiders just looks like they're wearing ghillie suits made of dinnerware. Exercise art direction with a bit of fucking aesthetic sense, for the love of God. Of War. I'll say one thing for Sega, they've never been afraid to represent people with hideous birth defects. This was the company that created a sidekick for their chief mascot with an extraneous tail, and presumably by extension an extraneous asshole. And then there was that thing from Knights with two additional legs growing out the top of its head. You wouldn't see Nintendo bring out a character with a third nipple or an anus in the centre of their forehead, and Sega are admirably continuing this tradition with Bayonetta, a game about a woman with legs of such bizarre proportion that she must have gotten her feet caught in a motorised winch while being extracted from the womb. When she sits down, her knees come up higher than her ice cream cone hairdo. I'd like to know who the fuck they got in to do motion capture work for this character, because all I can picture is a giraffe that's taken pole dancing lessons. Bayonetta is a witch. In accordance with the retranslation of vampires from closet lurking bogeymen to mopey solar powered disco balls, witches are now strippers who strap guns to all their hands and feet and cultivate their body hair into makeshift cat suits. The level of the sexualization going into this game is nothing short of shameless. Talk about it being ironic all you want, but that doesn't change the fact that someone's rubbing themselves off to it even as we speak. Everything Bayonetta does is fetishized. She wears glasses, sucks on chopper chups, uses BDSM techniques as special attacks, and occasionally all her clothes fly off and hairy monsters appear. Fuck, I've got out with girls like that. Fortunately, being English and therefore utterly repulsed by the slightest sexual urge of myself and everyone around me, I'm immune from any callous attempt to touch my heart via my wrinkly undercarriage, and Bayonetta looks about as sexy to me as a pencil that's been stuck through a couple of grapes. Get past the cock tease presentation and I could call the game adequate at best. I mean, at best. My like God of War butt stamp sadly has to be revised this week into my like Devil May Cry butt stamp, which should come as no surprise since Bayonetta has the same director. Hideki Kamiya, or however you say that, still has a knack for the completely ridiculous fight scene. I just wish someone would remind him he's a game designer once in a while. Bayonetta has the same Devil May Cry bollocks, where the characters will faff lengthily about in acrobatic violence within cutscenes while the player is expected to watch quietly while thinking, wow, I wish I could be having that much fun right about now. He is getting better though, because some of the cutscenes have QuickTime events. Tan fucking fastic. Maybe with a couple more games he'll eventually figure this out. The QTEs are irregular, very sudden, and give you an amount of time equivocal to the target audience's attention span. You really couldn't have implemented them any worse, unless the game redirected a tactical nuclear strike to your house every time you missed one. Although the briefness of the QTEs juxtaposes nicely against the unforgivably long loading times. Listen, PS3 developers, I honestly don't mind if you install stuff on the hard drive if it means we can avoid this shit. It's okay, we have a 320 gig here. The game loads when you walk across a room, it loads when you pick up an item, and every time you die it calls you a retard and loads for an extra long time. And you will die, you'll die a bum. I mean a lot. Unlike Darksiders, Bayonetta has more combos than a roadside cafe, and the game actually lets you practice them during the loading screens, which is quite a clever and pragmatic little feature. Of course, practicing in an empty room is one thing, and when I was in the game surrounded by enemies all busily trying to shove their staffs down my hideous giraffe throat, I ended up randomly smashing the two attack buttons and hitting dodge every time a nearby enemy so much as scratched his bum. Which worked for me, but at the rating at the end of the level, it'd always give me the dunce cap thanks for trying award for retards. I tried to make excuses. I'm sorry, miss, all the enemies were so fucked up looking, miss, it was hard to tell if they were telegraphing an attack or trying to hail a fucking cab, miss. But they fell on deaf ears. I don't mind that so much though, because at least I finished the levels, and it's rare to see a game like this that rewards finesse without becoming inaccessible to the layman playing on a civilized difficulty setting. And there's one feature I will happily debase myself in gratitude for, and that's mid-boss fight checkpoints. This is the sort of game where a boss can be the size of the moon and have 11 health bars, so chipping the first 10 away only to die from a casual elbow to the face can be garment-rendingly frustrating by itself without having to take it from the top. I strongly advise not trying to follow the story on your first run-through. There are some things for which the human mind just isn't equipped. Bayonetta was found at the bottom of a river 20 years ago and now works with demons from hell to kill angels, who are apparently evil because they keep attacking Bayonetta because she keeps attacking them. The baddies, or possibly the goodies, are trying to resurrect some big evil god thing which is linked to some ancient clan of witches and rival clan of sages and some associated evil corporation who presumably felt a bit left out. And there's this guy in a Harry Potter scarf who wants to either kill Bayonetta or bone her silly. And there's this little girl who's either Bayonetta's daughter or a younger version of herself. Sometimes I miss the old Pac-Man storytelling method. Eat pills, avoid ghosts, that's it. Only sometimes you can eat ghosts as well, if you... If you can cope with loading times that slam dunk all sense of game flow into a fucking volcanic vent, being called a spacker at the end of every level, listening to the same three up-tempo music tracks like you've borrowed an iPod for the world's most boring man, and the occasional cheap death pulled right out of the game's ass, I mean... arse, then I can recommend Bayonetta, because as spectacle fighters go, it certainly is a spectacle. Its overactive sex appeal does make me feel a little bit like I've walked in on someone humping their Japanese love pillow, but it's hilariously audacious when it's not merely fascinating. The game should last you a long time, because it's the sort of thing intended to be played over and over again, partly to figure out what the fuck's going on, and partly to unlock all the difficulty settings and extra bits, and to patiently hone a skill set that will have many practical applications in daily life, such as if you're ever called upon to enthusiastically text message someone while simultaneously polishing a pickled gherkin. After 2 years of this, I thought I was immune to being disappointed by games. Whoops, that's my entire opinion on Dark Void given away in one sentence, isn't it? But stick with me, there's more to this. It's not that I went into Dark Void thinking it would be good, because I don't go into any games thinking they'll be good. If I have to search through a dumpster for a lost wedding ring, I could try to convince myself that the dumpster will be full of cakes and freshly picked flowers, but I'll only be fooling myself. Dark Void is a dumpster that appeared to be full of rusty dog food tins, but once I got in I realised they were actually delicious novelty cakes made to look like rusty dog food tins, but then once I'd started eating them I discovered that the icing was made from wallpaper paste and cyanide, and that's why I feel it let me down. I wonder if the Geneva Convention covers torturing metaphors. Dark Void sets out a bit Crimson Skies-y, set in an alternative World War II. You know, it'd be nice to see a game set, say, in an alternative Napoleonic War for once, where Waterloo is fought on the backs of pterodactyls, and the main character is a pilot called Will, who borrowed his voice from Nathan Drake and his jacket from BJ Blazkowicz and all the other aspects from every protagonist from every game ever. He crashes his plane through the Bermuda Triangle and winds up in another world, a world that forms a bridge between the Earth and some other planet, presumably in some sort of stepping stone arrangement. There's an evil alien race that's about two parts Combine to two parts Covenant to one part Snatcher. Now there's an obscure reference, I'll probably bring up Flight of the Amazon Queen next. And they want to invade the Earth because they always do. What the fuck's so great about Earth? Good school district, handy for the shops, what? Anyway, our hero joins a ragtag human resistance and must save the world by flying around in a jetpack. Huh. The first couple of hours kind of sell the game short, half close your eyes and suddenly you're playing Uncharted with worse writing, which is kind of like being Julia Roberts but with slightly bigger teeth. And the main character is a lemon in a flight jacket who reacts to all this otherworldly killer robots business with all the emotion and personality of a man trying to sweep the ants off his kitchen floor. Even when he gets the jetpack he seems no more thrilled than he would when borrowing his dad's Lexus. His only sign of emotion is an apparent hatred of buttons. I guess he was traumatized as a child by a TV remote because he can never press button to open door when he can pulverize the console with his rifle butt. At first the jetpack stuff seemed like fairly average flight combat that's all manual aiming all the time. The turning point for me came when I had to land on an upright floating vessel thing, elbow a few consoles to set the self-destruct, then jump down a shaft, out the bottom of the ship, and turn on my jetpack before I imprint myself upon the ground, and I was like, shit up my nose, what right does this game have to suddenly kick ass? Dark Void's only new idea is the ability to seamlessly switch at any time between old-fashioned ploddy tortoise cover-based shooting on the ground and rocket pack whoosh crikey fun. And you know what? That could be enough. You can fly up onto a ledge to shoot more accurately at a key target, take off in the middle of a ground assault to attempt a strafing run, and if you turn on the jetpack indoors, you'll smear yourself across the walls and ceiling in a way that ragdoll physics makes an absolute joy to behold. The levels are necessarily huge, with a great sense of freedom within reason. It is hard to tell where the borders lie. Once I was flying around this big mesa and passed through the invisible level border, so my character did an automatic U-turn and instantly brained himself against the rock. But again, it was well comically timed, so I don't hold it against the game. My throat wants to turn inside out in rejection of this word, but it really is... cinematic, because it manages what feel like movie set pieces while staying within gameplay rather than cutscening me in conscious. But like a glass of milk with a spider in it, towards the end it all goes horribly wrong. 3 or 4 hours in, there's a very Half-Life 2-esque level where they take your jetpack away and make you watch the bad guy recording his video diary, but of course you break free and lead the daring escape, get your jetpack back so the fun can recommence. Then for some reason I never really grasped, you go to a big tower where you fight a three-headed robot dragon, then oop, end of game. I was in shock. I reloaded my last save because I was convinced there'd been some bizarre glitch that made the credits come up 3 or 4 hours too early. Then the other clues came together. Plot points and characters coming and going like targets on a firing range, that surreal giant monster boss fight that was set up at length as some huge epic encounter that you sprinkle with bullets for about 30 seconds and then it disappears off the face of the earth, or whatever planet we're on. And then I knew what Dark Void was, a game that ran out of something. It was either money, or time, or will, or employees, or maybe a giant monster frog to monitor their studio while battling Godzilla, but the point is, the developers planned out a huge epic game, the various components of their studio started working on all the little bits of the huge epic game, and then they ran out of laundry powder or whatever it was and had to string together all the little unfinished bits into something vaguely sellable. They wrote a script for Lord of the Rings and ended up having to perform it with finger puppets. A game that fails due to overambition is still better than a game that fails because it's beep boop committee designed sludge coughed out by a corporation staffed by robots. At least ambition implies that you have some kind of soul rather than a CPU with fistfuls of money stuffed into it. Having said that, Dark Void is the most I've ever been disappointed by a game. It's not the worst game I've ever reviewed. Too Human still takes that award, but Too Human was crispy fried puke right down to the fucking bone marrow. Dark Void started off pretty rocky, but between the rocks I caught a glimpse of something beautiful with a cleavage that could hold up a fucking Christmas tree. But once I'd caught up with it and we'd started making out, all its teeth fell out into my mouth and it gave me scurvy. There's a bit in Dead Space where Philip K. Asimov gets pulled down a hole by a tentacle and he almost claws his way back out of the hole before getting yanked back down to oblivion, and that's Dark Void. It's down, then up, then down again, like an Alzheimer's patient on a stairlift. Alright, fine, for fuck's sake, I'll review Borderlands if it will make you shut up. Except it won't, will it? We both know nothing could do that short of surgically removing your fucking jaw, and even then you can still drool down my ear. I've been here too many times before. I delay reviewing a game and all the fans of the game feel the only possible explanation is that I'm struck dumb by how good it is, but they nag me to review it anyway in order to confirm their feelings and level up their internet cocks. And then of course I piddle all over it in an act that you'd think would come as no surprise to anyone with the slightest grasp of pattern recognition, and a wounded, denial-ridden nerd mob leave hate comments suggesting that I must have misinterpreted my own opinion. Well, I need another week to play the two dicks gelatinous cube that is Mass Effect 2, so here we go again. I wish more developers would be as considerate as the Dark Void team and just stop making the game halfway through. The reason why I've been putting it off is because I'm well aware that Borderlands is best played 4-player co-op and I don't have that many friends. Even if I did, playing split-screen would have been like reading a Where's Wally book from across a room. Eventually I resigned myself to breaking my one rule of never playing multiplayer with people who are not in the same room as me and therefore bound by the most basic rules of social etiquette, held my nose and dived into the monkey house that is random game joining, catching fleeting glimpses in the 3 minutes before my connection died of a cruel world in which 3 uncommunicative specks on the horizon charged on ahead in pursuit of prizes, leaving me to the claws of 100 multicolored space lobsters. So fuck it, I said. Did a great man not once say that every game must be able to stand up on single player alone? Well yes, it was me on this very website, so it's practically my duty to review it single player style. Besides, saying something gets better when you do it with other people doesn't mean shit, because the same can be said of Hudson Hawk. Borderlands is a single-player FPS RPG, OMG, in which you play one, and just one, of 4 mercenaries who have come to the planet Pandora, which looks like what would happen if the cast of Mad Max and the Dukes of Hazzard intermarried then colonized the Middle East with an invading force of garbage trucks. You're there in search of something called the Vault, which is either a legendary bonanza, a myth orchestrated by the planetary tourist board, or a big fat MacGuffin to drive what little plot there is. The story aspect doesn't so much as take a back seat as it does get tied up with jump leads and dumped in the boot of a completely different car. Those characters who aren't just trying to repurpose your pelvis as a a shoe tree will only talk to you when they have side quests, and even then only in the form of a paragraph on an impersonal briefing screen. It's one of those games that seem like all the actual drama is going on whenever you're not around, I guess because it'd be hard to fit into your busy schedule of shooting the same 4 or 5 guys in the face 50,000 times. Whatever, it's the old Momorpagus setup. All those girly things like story and words are all just a framework for the missions, or perhaps I should say the mission. The mission is to go into a scrapyard and shoot Jason Voorhees. Never before has cover art been so indicative of a game's content, because that's literally all you do. Sometimes it's just for the killing itself, sometimes it's because Jason has stolen something you want to get back. Occasionally the mission is to shoot Jason's dog or his pet killer space lobsters, but there'll probably be a few Jasons hanging out on the way. It's like all the mission providers have bought shares in the local hockey mask factory. I suppose this is geared to the Momorpagus crowd, who are well known for putting up with all the samey grind in the world if it means they get experience points and fancy weapons with blue names at the end of it. I've had a great idea for a game these people would love. It comes with a special USB glove peripheral, and you get 1 experience point for each time you punch yourself in the face. I might as well mention that there's vehicle driving for swiftly getting from one Jason-infested scrapyard to another, vehicles which handle like a fat dog on a space hopper, and are about as sturdy and well-armored as an egg and crisp sandwich, but what I really want to talk about is the GUI. It's been a while since I've seen in-game menus as bad as these. It's like PowerPoint threw up on a Cluedo board and died. You're constantly switching out weapons for slightly better models, like a militant germaphobe, which is par for the course. The little window showing the stats of your current weapon appearing when you hover over a different weapon in a shop is always a nice feature in RPGs, so why the fuck doesn't Borderlands do it? You want to compare, you click on compare, then scroll all the way down through the other shop items, then click on your weapon. Interface 101. The less clicks, the better. There's no excuse for it. Also, you can't delete quests from your log without completing them. And you won't complete them all, because you level up very fast and they quickly become too trivial to bother with. So you end up at level 30 with your 3 current quests mixed up in a list with 50 quests to go clean the starting areas outside lavatory. Yes, these are small complaints, but in a game as repetitive as this, the small complaints constantly come back to niggle at you until you're wearing them all like a big hat. The fact that you level up fast is completely lost on your little robot buddy, who regularly nags you to pick up the 3 level 12 quests from some brown smear on the landscape purporting to be an NPC, cheerfully oblivious of the fact that you turned those quests down 10 levels ago and his voice is like Angle Grinder of the Eardrum. I think this character is specifically designed to be annoying, in which case the developers should be congratulated for doing their job so well, and tactfully reminded that deliberately annoying is still annoying. At the end of it all, Borderlands is well presented, but get under the sheen of polish, it's just a dull, sparse, nuts and bolts shooter with some unnecessarily good writing bridging the slow process of watching numbers steadily increase. A game for the kind of person who takes photos of his car's odometer whenever it clocks another 1,000 miles. And it might be true that it becomes tolerable if you do it with some friends around, but so is dying of bowel cancer, and that way they might even feel obliged to take you skydiving. In case you've lost your memories the last few years from being slapped particularly hard by your dad's cock, Mass Effect 1 was BioWare's epic sci-fi action RPG with some spicy NPC diddling that did the controversy circuit before any of the knee-jerk busybody twat sandwiches involved took time out to actually play the game and see there was barely enough flesh to satisfy the world's least choosy cannibal. And Mass Effect 2's diddle content seems determined to be even less erection-friendly. I went to all the trouble of picking the most appallingly wussy conversation options just to woo the woofy wadey, and all I got out of it was a bra and a bit of pants on dry humping. With all the futuristic zip-up outfits these people wear, that seemed like a highway to an unwanted bell-end piercing. I assume this was an attempt to avoid the same media outcry as last time, to which I would say, you do know why the first game sold so well, don't you, BioWare? Because it wasn't for the fucking vehicle sections. My unimpressed penis aside, Mass Effect 2 does something I haven't seen since the Quest for Glory and Ultima games, and that's the ability to import a Commander Shepard from the first game and slip him back on like a comfortable pair of space trousers, and whatever choices you made back then occasionally come up in the story of this one. Commander Shepard, legendary space hero whose gender went unrecorded by history, goes missing for 2 years and turns up dead, but then he becomes alive again, so I guess he's a space vampire now. In the meantime, the human race has grown in power throughout the galaxy, either because the alien-run council all got killed in the last game, or because they've been sitting around eating space donuts for 2 years, and a new threat has risen, as indeed it must, because you can't just spend a whole game knocking back Singapore slings on a beach somewhere outside of the Dead or Alive franchise, in the form of human colonies mysteriously disappearing. Presumably they all heard there was another Mass Effect game coming and ran away before they could become part of a vehicle section. A little prematurely, as it turns out, because the vehicle sections themselves seem to have had the same idea. They're conspicuously absent, as is the ability to go down to random planets and explore a square mile of terrain. While I definitely don't miss the bouncy castle shopping trolley car physics, the free-roaming planets did give the game universe a sense of tangible bigness, while most of Mass Effect 2 feels like swapping between a bunch of enclosed shooting galleries before coming back to your ship to play with your train sets. Off-roading around random planets is now replaced by scanning the surface from orbit, launching probes to extract resources, which is as interesting as it sounds, and it sounds like this. You don't have to do it, but you need the resources to buy upgrades and get the best ending. This is supposed to be an exciting space adventure. Commander Shepard should acquire resources by shooting them out of a monster's face, or by extracting them from the throats of alien hotties with his tongue. So Shepard's car has disappeared, and apparently he was keeping his inventory management system in the boot, because that's gone too, and thank fuck for that. Instead of hoarding piles of guns and armor, swapping out your equipment for the latest models, and pawning off truckloads of obsolete gear after every single mission, which is always the second most tedious part of RPGs after picking the shrink wrap off the box, now you stick to the same guns and armor and just upgrade them. Yay! Except you can only get upgrades through the the planet scanning mechanic. Boo! You can also customize Shepard's armor colors, so of course I dressed him up in hot pink in memory of his long forgotten comrade Commander Gobblecock. As for the combat, it does get repetitive since Mr. Vehicle Section didn't show up for work, and Mr. Cover Based Shooting has to pretty much hold up gameplay by itself, and dare I say it's also a bit too easy. Ambushes are always laughably predictable because of the telltale sign of chest high walls, and I was a sniping specialist, so all the biggest battlefield threats went down before they even got close enough to call me a tosser. You can give your party members specific directions, but I got through the whole game without ever needing to, because by the time it would hypothetically become necessary, all the enemies were whistling jaunty tunes through the holes in their heads. The writing's solid, but then BioWare don't score points for that anymore. Birds fly, fish swim, Michael Atkinson molests dogs, and BioWare games have good writing. But when the characters deliver the dialogue, they always come down with the BioWare face, that Uncanny Valley-esque look of oddness, because the voices and the physical movements are created separately. You can almost see them going over their stage directions in their heads. Hello, Commander Shepard, wave hand. I heard you might show up today, nod head. How about those freaky aliens, eh? Shake fist, grr grr, slightly racist undercurrent. As in the last game, your conversation choices give you points in Paragon and Renegade. It's not exactly a moral choice system, just defines whether you swing towards Dirty Harry or Captain Picard. Late in the game, persuasion options pretty much need all Paragon or all Renegade, which messes up the role-playing a bit. When you're choosing whether to free a race of slaves or force them to strip off and dance about while you take photographs, you're not thinking, what would I do in this situation? You're thinking, which option gives me the best dickhead points, because I need them to persuade crewman A to take her top off. When the bottom falls out of the game criticism market and I have to start prostituting myself to developers, BioWare would be one of my first ports of call, because there are few enough developers in the world who treat writing as an integral part of the game rather than an optional set of colourful tassels to put on the handlebars. So Mass Effect 2 is very well written and epic and immersive and all that, but gameplay-wise it's still flailing around like a neurotic 20-something checkout girl trying to find the right combination of hats and dresses. They discarded the ugly yellow sun hat of vehicle sections and tried on the frumpy brown frock of resource mining, and it's still not quite working. For Mass Effect 3, and I know there will be a Mass Effect 3 because the loading screens rather unsubtly remind you to hang on to your save games, they should try bringing back the planet surface exploration but let you navigate the terrain with jetpacks and populate it with giant wolves that shoot lasers out of their mouths. If I wanted to be a space quantity surveyor, I'd play EVE Online. The Divine Comedy really does paint God as a little bit too choir boys short of a molestation racket if all that Old Testament business didn't already tip you off. Hey, says God, I've made it so it feels really, really good to stick certain body parts together and jiggle them around and hardwired your brain to want to do it pretty much 24/7 between the ages of 13 and 70. But if you actually do it without a special permission slip from the church, then I'm going to light you on fire. And that's just in purgatory. If you also didn't spend every Sunday reminding me what a level-headed and, if I may say so, strikingly handsome fellow I am, then I'm also going to staple your cock shut and feed you to a wolf. Dante's Inferno makes me wonder, is there a circle in hell for people who make shitty knockoff hack and slashers? Dante's Inferno the poem is history's first recorded work of self-insert fanfiction, and Dante's Inferno the game is a loose adaptation where all the characters are a cross between a professional wrestler and a Cenobite. Dante himself is not a poet, but a testosterone-flooded Florentine crusader who completely fails to grasp how a tattoo is supposed to work, and who must descend through 9 levels of challenge to rescue his girlfriend, not the first Italian to do so. Now, in the film industry, movies tend to get overpublicized when the studios detect the whiff of monster turd about them in order to sell as many tickets on opening weekend as they can before word of mouth gets around. And if the same is true of game publishers, then one would expect the Dante's Inferno box to contain nothing but a dead mouse and the Ebola virus. The game has been marketed up at the Raging Fiery Ringpiece over the last year. I myself received a special singing box that I had to smash open to shut up, whereupon it accused me of being wrathful. Touché, Dante's Inferno, but I'd rather go to the hell for the wrathful than the hell for people who work in the EA marketing department, which I'm pretty sure is the EA marketing department. So for the third time this year, I get to wheel out my Like God of War butt stamp, but this time with the word cut off the end. Dante's Inferno is Like God of War, a pseudo-historical journey through mythology as directed by Eli Roth and sponsored by the Flymo Lawnmower Company, hosted by a very shouty man with some prominent red body art all over his exposed man tits, whose backstory gets revealed piecemeal throughout the course of the game to sort of justify his behaviour but not really, and who has a signature bladed weapon with heavy attacks for Sir and light attacks for the Lady. There's a fixed camera for whom showing off the detailed and artistic level design is slightly higher priority-wise than letting the player see what the fuck they're doing. There are bits where you climb over walls, except that the walls made from the tightly packed bodies of the damned, nature's stepladder, and of course quick time events come to visit from the lesser known 47th Circle of Hell for unpleasable game critics in both the monster takedown and the survive the cutscene varieties. So all in all, you could swap out the disc for God of War 2 while the player pops out for a piss, and there's a good chance they won't notice, at least until they realise that the game has suddenly become good. Now, if you're making a knockoff of a good game, the least you could do is knock it off properly. There's little variety to the combat. You only get one melee weapon whose light attacks are like the warm kiss of a gentle summer breeze across the face of a cheerful baby, and whose heavy attacks get interrupted like a man with chronic hiccups giving the keynote speech to Tourette Syndrome convention. And a lot of the enemies have stupid amounts of health, even on normal difficulty, which doesn't make things more challenging. It just pads out the gameplay length as you repeatedly bash a low-level zombie like you're trying to make fire without matches on his face. But at one point I dropped down to easy mode because I had to attempt a room for the third or fourth time, and I was well overdue for the evening's wang, so there's a fairly vast gulf between the first two difficulty settings, at least until you realise that your projectile attack costs nothing and most of the enemies are largely melee focused, and if mashing the Hadouken button from across the room while a lumbering monster attempts to get you into battle axe range before its nipples cave in sounds like fun, then clearly God created your Warbrain on opposite day. The other major departure from God of War, besides not being good, is the level up system. When using finishing moves on monsters, you have two options: punish, i.e. smash their face in, or absolve, i.e. smash their face in, but in a pious way. You also run into the occasional superstar celebrity damned soul, who basically act as free experience buckets. Again, you either renegade them into finely sliced ham, or paragon them to paradise by playing Guitaru Man for 30 bored seconds. You see, you have one set of upgrades for holy experience, and one for unholy. Ahahahahaha, you might say. Moral choice system, Well, not really, I would reply. More a violent option, or equally violent but better spirited option. And I suppose you would continue that since holy points are slightly harder to get, that holy upgrades would be slightly better, and that it all might be leading towards some alternative ending scenario where too many damnations land you a big fat steaming two-bedroom apartment made of poo and saw blades on the ninth circle. No, say I presume that was the original intention, but I guess they used up the ending cinematic budget, rendering Dante's hairy bum, spoiler alert. And the upgrade tracks are pretty much equivocal. So what's the point of having two separate experience levels, you ask? Well, it's like my right hand on a Sunday night, I say. Why is that, you ask? It beats the fuck out of me! There's quite a lot to get through when you're adapting the Inferno, and you don't want to chuck the perjurers in with the false prophets. It screws up the whole filing system. Dante's Inferno makes the effort to work everything in, so the levels all go by rather quickly, and things get a bit half-assed later on, except for that whole hairy bum business. After an at least fairly creative first half, the 8th Circle consists of nothing but 10 identical challenge rooms, and afterwards that whole business with the love interest gets resolved rather awkwardly fast. Not that she was particularly interesting as love interests go, although for an unsullied virtuous innocent, she seemed alarmingly keen to get her tits out. Anyway, it just smacks of rushing things towards the end, so in that spirit, here's my summary. Nothing special, wait for God of War 3, hairy bum. I've had a lot to say about sequels in the course of this series, how some are good, but a lot are ropey strings of flavourless wallpaper paste squirted from the backsides of uncreative publishers with seriously fucked up eating habits. I think I've worked out the formula now. A good sequel, like Half-Life 2, Silent Hill 2, Tranmere Rovers 3, is one that uses the original as a jumping-off point for a whole new story with a whole new technology, while a bad sequel merely wallows in the original, like a hippo in a vat of liquidized children. So where does Bioshock 2 go? Well, I'm ashamed to admit it might actually transcend the formula, just as the original had a surprisingly intelligent undertone that deconstructed the very nature of linear gameplay. Bioshock 2 is a sophisticated satirization of the very concept of a sequel that, I'm just messing with you, it's a knock-off piece of shit. So the wallpaper-paste squirting bean counters from 2K asked themselves what was a popular aspect of Bioshock 1 we can focus on in the sequel in order to wring as many pennies as we can out of the property, and someone said, the big daddies, of course. I think you should get to play as one. What, said someone else, those haunting monstrous things that trudge around as if they can barely support their own weight, those tragic figures reduced to single-function robots with no trace of humanity left that seem to embody the downfall of the city as a whole. That's a stupid fucking idea, it'd be like a sequel to Half-Life where you get to play as a gun turret. No, said the first guy, you play as a prototype big daddy who can move at normal speed and use multiple weapons and plasmids. Well, you're not a big daddy then, are you, said the second guy, you're just the bloke from the first game with a fishbowl on his head. And besides, why would a prototype be more efficient than the finished model? Did they think that big daddy's being fast, flexible, and capable of self-preservation was just not being fair on everyone else? The story deserves close examination, because Bioshock 1 was incredibly strong in this aspect, that's kind of the point, there was no need to tack another story on, it's like ordering the lobster Thermidor and sellotaping a Snickers bar to it. 10 years on, Rapture's somehow still inhabitable, despite last time around it having more leaks than British military intelligence, and has been taken over by a political dissident with a voice so smug that you want to jam a comically oversized syringe in her eye every time she opens her fucking mouth, who has turned the whole place into a sort of pseudo-communist cult. Your quest is to rescue your little sister, now just a plain old normal-sized sister, who can communicate with you and the other little sister telepathically, a plot point that kind of hopes to slip by unnoticed, but which you then grab and pull back by one of its dangling threads. How could she do this? Is this because of Adam, or did she just wish upon a star? Oh, it's for convenience, I see. Anyway, your psychic hotline friend is to be the victim of a procedure that will combine all the great minds of Rapture into one person, and how the fuck does that work? Wouldn't her head need to be about 6 foot across? I think Adam has become the equivalent of the Force in Star Wars, all-purpose cavity plot insulation. Most of the gameplay is pretty much unchanged, a largely resource-based shooter, where you take one or two hits from pretty much every fight, but then you hunt through the neutralized areas and scarf down a few cratefuls of cakes and potato chips through your helmet, apparently, or perhaps Adam lets you absorb nutrients from the fucking ether. Just as before, the right combinations of boosts and plasmids can totally break the game. In my case, I found that slinging hypnosis blobs around and making all the sploices attack each other allowed me to spend most of the combat sitting in the corner mashing candy bars against my faceplate. So what is different? Hacking, for a start. Instead of playing Pipe Dream for half an hour at every turn, you do a pseudo QuickTime event for a few seconds instead, and apparently the universe is about to explode because a QuickTime event is actually improved a game. The other major difference is that instead of rescuing little sister straight away, you have to carry them around and let them gather Adam for you, which evokes that one bit in Bioshock 1 where you pretend to be a big daddy and defend little sisters from sploicers. You remember, the absolute worst fucking part of that game. Here's the Bioshock 2 moral choice. Fight a big daddy, no small task, adopt the little sister, carry her to a corpse somewhere on the level, defend her from waves of sploicers for a minute, using up half your health kits and ammo, carry her to another corpse, defend her again to use up the other half, then carry her all the way to an exit vent, and only then can you rescue her. Alternatively, fight a big daddy, then pull the little sister's fucking spine out. Yeah, you get the bad ending, but fuck it, I've got places to be. And both options have a chance of spawning a big sister, so if you say you used up all your health and ammo defending your little sister, then it's time to take a probe right up the Mariana Trench. Here's an idea, 2K, how about only spawning a big sister if I take the evil harvest option? Surely that would give the big sister a valid reason to be cross. Otherwise she's all like, grr, your selfless compassion fills me with murder frenzy. Alternatively, just don't even fucking bother. Adam is not as vital as the game would have you believe. All you need are a few core combat plasmids and the right gene tonics, a lot of which are just lying around for free. By the last couple of levels, I just played live and let live with the big daddies and got by just fine, although one I had to kill in self-defense for various unimportant reasons, so I just left his little sister loudly weeping by his corpse while I went off to loot. Stop crying, you little bitch, from trying to eat these cakes. The usual line at this point is, if you liked Bioshock 1, you'll like this because it's pretty much just more of it, but I don't think that applies, because if you did really like Bioshock 1, you'll understand that it worked perfectly fine by itself, the story very tight and self-contained with no dangling plot threads. Our hero escapes, Rapture falls, and all the leaders are dead with nine irons jutting out of their skulls. A sequel like Bioshock 2, riddled with metaphorical stretch marks trying to squeeze in enough retcons to get another plot out, can only diminish the effect of the original, but if you're thick and just want to play with the big daddies some more, then I guess it'll tide you over until Bioshock 3, which presumably will let you play as a fucking vending machine. Aliens vs. Predator is one of those concepts you're probably not supposed to think too much about, especially not the title. Surely they're both aliens, and come to think of it, they're both predators too. Perhaps a more explanatory title is necessary, like Big Dribbly Black Thing That Likes Eating Lance Henriksen and Has a Head That Makes You Wonder About What Sort of Relationship H.R. Geiger Had With His Father, versus Big Clicky Invisible Thing With a Crab For a Face That Always Seems to End Up Getting Beaten Up By Big Stupid Lance Wearing Dirty Pants. Really, any title would be better than Aliens vs. Predator, or at least easier on the filing system. Try not to confuse this Aliens vs. Predator with Alien vs. Predator for the SNES from 1993, nor the arcade Alien vs. Predator from 1994, nor indeed the Alien vs. Predator for the Atari Jaguar from the same year. Although feel free to confuse it for the Aliens vs. Predator released for PC and Mac in 1999, because it's the same fucking game! The plot is that Aliens plot, for there is only one. You know what I mean, that one plot Geiger's alien drags around everywhere it goes like a fucking security blanket. Aliens take over a facility, Marines get sent in to take care of it the same way that bits of bread get sent into ponds to take care of the ducks, and there's inevitably some evil, stupid business stroke military guy who wants to harness the aliens, and the more times this happens, the more evil and stupid they get. Okay, so the last 60 evil, stupid guys who tried to control the aliens all got their brains spread on cream crackers and served as canapes at the alien hoedown, but I think their problem was just not being evil and stupid enough. This is Aliens vs. Predator though, so there are predators too, who show up now and then to a chorus of "What the fuck was that?" from nearby human NPCs. And I'm waiting for someone to reply, "It's a fucking predator, you moron. The human race has only encountered them like 50 times. Did no one document anything? Didn't at least one survivor put an entry on his fucking live journal? Or did we use up all the data storage media recording all these fucking audio logs?" As usual, there are three story campaigns, and in spite of the title, the Marine campaign is the longest, probably because of racism. It's also by far the weakest, a fairly generic FPS that at first takes the Doom 3 route to creating easy horror by putting you in dark rooms with a flashlight circle the size of a leprechaun's testicle, but after a while gets bored and flicks the light on for the remainder in a spirited attempt for the generic gold medal. It's not even that scary, because current generation graphics being what they are, the aliens all have this wet glisten effect that make them easy to spot like they're adorned with Christmas lights. That's when they even bother to show up. There's a fine line between atmospheric pacing and just having fuck all happen. Half an hour in, I'd gone to three or four empty control rooms to press magic plot continuation buttons, and was starting to wonder if the aliens hadn't gone to the wrong address or something. The side quest is collecting audio logs, and they're all the usual suspects. Passive-aggressive man who complains about how the guys running the place are all evil and stupid, hysterical man in the cupboard who gets abruptly cut off by grisly noises, and that one very credulous fellow who starts worshipping the aliens as gods, and who will probably end up deliberately sucking on a facehugger, nature's communion wafer. Then there's the alien campaign, which is much better. If I must listen to all the human characters' dreadful voice acting, at least let me chew their necks off afterwards. The setup is agreeably uncomplicated, humans tasty, let's eat them all, yum yum. From there, it's really just a loosely tied sequence of stealth missions where you crawl around the walls, ceiling and ventilation system, cracking open unaware skulls like so many Cadbury's cream eggs. The annoyance is that stealth is your only option. Toe-to-toe, you're about as effective against assault rifles as a glass tea towel. Getting around in the dark enclosed environments is a wee bit wonky, with a really fast movement and constant shifting of orientation. This isn't the sort of thing that works well from a first-person perspective. It's like playing from the point of view of a cat in a tumble dryer, and with roughly the same sound effects. It's also the shortest campaign. It's like taking a little lunch break between the human and predator missions to eat at the Chateau de Bitey Head. Now, the predator tends to be the odd one out in these things. The other two campaigns seem to have trouble finding things for him to do. Besides the fact that part of the game takes place in his holiday home, and the occasional skinned body hanging down like the meat in a kebab shop, his only presence is one fight for each character. Personally, I blame the humans. It's not supposed to be aliens versus predator versus dipshits. Humans fighting off two slavering, murderous extraterrestrial races just feels a wee bit redundant. As for the predator's campaign, it's pretty fun too. It's also very stealth-focused, as again, you can't seem to take take much machine gun fire. I guess all that expensive predator armor is about as much use as hanging teacups on your nipples. When humans are around, you just have to Batman Arkham Asylum their fat asses by using distracting noises, since they're all as thick as asphalt milkshakes. When aliens are around, that is, the other kind of aliens, it plays like a hack and slasher that was designed by a Pilchard. Knocking them down with light and heavy swipes and pressing X to finish them off sounds straightforward enough, but the Predator is nothing if not a massive drama queen who insists on taking his sweet time with his fancy overlong finishers, leaving you exposed and immobile for several seconds while every other monster in the room queues up to bite off your combi stick. The trouble with this kind of superstar tag team crossover event, especially with video game development being the time and money black hole that it is that it can't focus on anything. Three campaigns means three mediocre stories, three sets of mediocre gameplay mechanics, and three equally ugly protagonists. It's called spreading yourself too thin. The Marine campaign especially is like a stupid fat kid who your parents force you to play with and who leaves half-eaten toffee apples all over your treehouse, giving you less time to spend with your other friends, Dribbles and Joey Crabface. You know what? Predator campaign, 6 hours longer, with Titan combat from a third-person perspective and with AI that can tie its fucking shoelaces, that's a game I'd recommend, except then you'd pretty much just be playing Arkham Asylum after Batman lost his moral compass and tried to French kiss an angle grinder.
I can't help but feel I've come in the wrong door. I'm a game critic, you see, and Heavy Rain is a game in the same way that Ian Thorpe is a salmon. Okay, they both splash about in water, but you'd be embarrassed if you tried to make moose out of Ian Thorpe. I could pass it on to a film critic, but I already know what one would say. Why is this film 10 hours long? Why do I have to hold this curious V-shaped piece of plastic? If I just say it's great, will you quote me on the poster? I think we need a whole new kind of critic for Heavy Rain. Critics of interactive storytelling experiences, or wankers, as they will come to be known. As it happens, all we have on hand is a game critic, which is a shame, because as a game, it's a stack of poo-poo pancakes garnished with Ian Thorpe moose. Heavy Rain is the spiritual sequel to Fahrenheit, aka Indigo Prophecy, aka Baron von Teapot's fucking ludicrous adventure, and is presumably an attempt to make this particular brand of brown drippy lightning strike twice. Now say what you like about Fahrenheit, thank you, I think I will. It was a pretentious river of quicktime events with a plot that got its head caught in a bucket of doolally halfway through, but say what you like about Fahrenheit, at least stuff happened in it. Game starts, boom, you stabbed a bloke. You've got 30 seconds to wash off the blood and stuff the corpse into a bin, and you haven't even pulled your socks up. Meanwhile, Heavy Rain starts. You wake up, have a shower, get dressed, slap yourself in the face, have a drink, go sit in the garden for a while. Your kids come home, you play with your kids, then you stab your kids with a knife. Oh no, wait, that was just me stabbing an electrical socket to make something interesting happen. Everything's so fucking saccharine and happy families in the opening scenes too. It's like there's a big neon sign on the roof saying tragedy striking in 10, or rather in about an hour. And then there's another hour or so of moping around before the next hilarious tragedy strikes. The gameplay aspect, or interactive storytelling experience play aspect rather, is split between two modes. The first can best be described as a time-killing simulator. You walk around someone's house, staring at the contents of the fridge, fiddling with the ornaments, looking for the action that keeps the plot going, or just waiting for enough time to pass for someone else to do it. It's like playing a simulation of me trying to get some writing done, except I'm coming off the medication for some kind of serious dental procedure because the remote-controlled tank-style movement controls are shampoo-drinkingly awful. The other mode is what I would reservedly call the action scenes, pre-animated sequences dotted with quick-time events. Now, I've said before that QTEs sometimes work if they're a core part of gameplay, and in this case, they're core, flesh, seeds, branch, and the entire fucking apple tree. But the action is always rather overwrought. It's like someone came to the understandable conclusion that Heavy Rain is a touch slow at times, in the same way that St. Paul's Cathedral is a touch indigestible, so they figured they'd better throw in some loosely relevant karate fight scenes, the most incongruous of which is early on when a woman fights off multiple attackers in her pants, which turns out to be a dream sequence with zero connection to the plot. Good of you to notice that I was getting bored, Heavy Rain, but this was like splicing a song and dance routine into the middle of Zodiac. After about 3 hours, or around your second brain hemorrhage, the actual plot kicks in. A sort of bargain basement jigsaw killer kidnaps a small boy and sparks off the race to track him down. You quantum leap between the perspectives of four characters, the kid's dad, like Fahrenheit's main protagonist, a squinty, strangely accented everyman on the run from the cops who spends most of the game getting the shit kicked out of him, a fat private investigator not interesting enough to dwell on, a sexy lady whose chief role is to get exploited throughout the course of the plot, having to fight in her pants, strip off a gunpoint and almost take a cordless drill right up the hairy front bottom, and an FBI investigator. There's a fun game you can play with him. He's the only character who has access to technology beyond the mid-90s, so go through the game assuming he's a time traveler from the future. It honestly fits really well. His subplot involves him struggling with some kind of smack habit, so whenever he gets nosebleeds and the shakes, I like to pretend he's feeling the effects of changing history Marty McFly style. While you couldn't find a slower boil except by maybe holding a cigarette lighter under a swimming pool, once it gets going, Heavy Rain actually has some really good bits. The Zenith is a hauntingly visceral and fucking hard to watch scene in which you must use a sequence of complex buttonholes to force a character to cut off part of their own body. Which just goes to show how budget this jigsaw ripoff is. None of these fancy metaphorical torture traps, just hack off an extremity where I can see you, bitch. Anyway, that whole scene gripped me by the bell end. I've never accepted it gets better later as an excuse, and I do feel you'd be well within your rights to get bored after 2 hours and throw the disc down a fucking cooling tower, but for what it's worth, Heavy Rain does get better later, and I suppose all the time you spend instructing your character to watch TV and tie their shoelaces and wash their hands after having a wee-wee does raise the immersion somewhat, even if the sillier of the action sequences tend to body slam it back down again. Just like in Fahrenheit, the claim is that every decision has consequences, which is true, I guess. Walking across a room will have the consequence of you being on the opposite side of the room. As for decisions that actually affect anything beyond the current scene, there's a handful of rather obvious obviously telegraphed choices mainly dotted around the second half that will dictate who ends up with the positive press and who ends up carking it in a lonely grave, there's one unbearably happy ending if you get everything right, so any other outcome just feels like a non-standard game over, especially since a few paths depend on passing QTE sequences, which isn't a choice, it's just penalising any old people who might be playing. But the stupidest thing is this, it's a murder mystery plot and the identity of the killer is always the same. I was assuming the choices you made changed who the killer would be, since virtually everyone with a car and two working limbs was a suspect. What's the point of playing a mystery story again if you know the mystery? It's like trying to jerk off a castrated dog. He won't thank you for it, and all you'll get is wrist exercise.
Duke Nukem, all is forgiven. The one-liners, the average running speed of 60 miles per hour, even all the stripper business that meant I had to play with one hand hovering over the reset button whenever my mum was around. I'll wait as long as you want me to, just please let me play another shooter where I can have more weapons than eyeballs. Where if I get bored, I can clear out a room with the transfunctionating cyber blaster bollocks cannon I was saving for the next boss fight. Where I can run out into the open with the tactics of a suicide bomber and suffer no damage that can't be fixed by sellotaping a first aid kit to my chest. I'll be glad when the modern warfare bubble blows over and we can end the tyranny of realism. I've spent more time making US Marines lurch slowly through desert and jungle environments looking for bits of wall to hide behind while their legs grow back than I've spent having sex. I'm starting to get aroused by damaged masonry. As you may have already extrapolated, Bad Company 2 is a realistic war shooter. At least I assume so, it's hard to tell through all the dust. The Russians have taken over large chunks of the world and are starting to give the borders of the US some funny looks. What is it with modern war games in Russia lately? Last time I checked, it hasn't been 1979 for at least 10 years. It's like America's some washed-up prizefighter trying to smack-talk an old retired opponent who's just trying to get drunk and play tennis in peace. But to dwell on the politics is to miss the point. Russia is just a convenient label for an amorphous antagonistic mass to drive the plot. There's no evidence of any kind of ideology or motive for the conflict besides because they're just dicks. The focus is on a little bridge club of four soldiers, and there's an emphasis on characterization, meaning that each of the soldiers has precisely one character trait that they bring across so often they might as well just wear sandwich boards. The nerdy one, the southern one, the sergeant who constantly tempts fate by going on and on about his upcoming retirement, although curiously enough never actually dies, and the actual protagonist, whose distinguishing feature is the ability to talk without moving his lips. So it's another realistic cover-based shooter, because apparently we can't fucking get enough of those, where the gameplay time is entirely split between gunfighting in collections of small buildings and chest-high walls, or travelling to the next one. You need at least one unique feature though, even if it's just a gravy cannon or an enemy wearing dealy boppers, so Bad Company's thing is destructo scenery, like what Red Faction Guerrilla did. This time, however, you are not a thunderous Norse god, to whom the laws of physics kowtow neath his mighty todger. In this game, the explosions have their piss pipes aimed resolutely at your breakfast cereal. Explosions tear up both your cover and the enemies, and you don't have the super homing x-ray vision bestowed by the NPC gods. With the Battlefield series being so snipe-happy, gameplay becomes akin to crouching behind a desk, trying to read a Where's Wally book from the house across the street, and every time you raise your head to look at it for longer than 2 seconds, you're savaged by a flock of vampire bats, and occasionally you fail to notice that the Truckosaurus has chewed a perfectly square-shaped hole in the wall of your house that has permitted the ingress of a raging panther. In fact, there's a general visibility problem. I mentioned dust earlier, and now I'm going to mention it again. Dust! It's ridiculous, it's like rascally children have run through all the levels letting off dry powder fire extinguishers, and the slightest explosion throws up impenetrable pea soup fogs that take about 10 seconds or 15 bullets to the head to clear. Are you trying to hide something from me, Bad Company 2, you coy little strumpet? Do you maybe not want me to actually see the destructo physics in action, in case I notice that it's all done by some kind of fairy godmother making entire sections of wall magically vanish into the ether? And even when there aren't any explosions going on, when you're scanning a distant compound with your sniper rifle trying to decide which soldier will be the best one to kill first before every enemy in a 2 mile radius deduces your exact position like a vodka drinking sextant, everything from a certain distance disappears into this weird glowing haze, like the Russians are occupying the surface of Mercury, which is beyond even the most liberal interpretation of Lebensraum. A lot of the game can be summed up with the phrase, modern warfare, cluck cluck, jibber jibber, hello, bang, dead. It even does that same loading screen thing Modern Warfare did, where it zooms into a satellite map of your next location like you're being stalked by Google Maps. But while Bad Company 2 seeks to ape Modern Warfare's approach of railroading you into spectacular set pieces to slacken your peasant jaw, it forgets that this works best if the set pieces do not murder you. There's a sequence where you and your squad have to run down a street that's being mortared, which was supposed to be a quick exciting moment but which took me about 50 tries because surviving a shell to the face takes a little more than can-do spirit and a big moustache. I try to run through it, I get pounded into the dirt. I try to run to cover and wait for it to pass, it plows through my cover, I get pounded into the dirt. I follow directly behind my teammates but they can't die, so it's the blind leading the blind, and the second blind guy is a sparrow with brittle bone disease who gets pounded into the dirt. The best part is it was apparently a friendly mortaring being conducted by the goodies. Is there not some third side to this conflict I could join, preferably one that isn't full of dicks? I'm on the Cock Express sharing a cabin with Errol Flynn. Perhaps realistic shooter isn't the right term for games like Bad Company 2. In a truly realistic shooter, you'd get shot once, then laid up for 6 months before the hospital you're in gets blown up by an IED, and you're forced to crawl to safety with half a leg missing before getting shot by twitchy border patrolmen. All of which is preceded by about 6 months of doing push-ups with a load of sweaty people you're not allowed to make love to. A better name for the modern warfare thing would be Deranged Paranoid Power Fantasy for right-wing shut-ins who would blow their own nuts off the moment they were handed an actual firearm and probably already have done. Shooter. What additions Bad Company 2 does make to the tired formula only serve to annoy. And how many more times a game's gonna make me shoot rockets at a helicopter? It It almost makes me want to research and develop a new form of military-grade aerial transport just so games can give me something else to shoot rockets at. I would respect a war game that let me fire rockets at a giant Gatling gun-equipped pink dirigible shaped like a naked woman. Or perhaps respect is the wrong word. Being a highly respected and successful professional game critic, shut up, I am! I'm often asked for advice on how to pursue a similar career. So here's today's hot tip for budding critics. If you're resigned to playing through an extremely long game that you have good reason to think you will despise, don't attempt to do so in the week before you open a small licensed venue in the city's busiest entertainment district. I was only able to play Final Fantasy XIII for about 5 hours, partly because I was being called out most afternoons to buy more napkins, and partly because any more than 2 hours of this fucking game at a time was even more draining than the hangover from VIP and media nights. I suppose I could have held off for another week to play it some more, but the thing is, I don't fucking want to. Subjecting myself to any more of it could probably be classified as self-flagellation, so for what it's worth, here's a review of the first 5 hours. You might call that unprofessional. I call it efficiency. Final Fantasy XIII, The Empire Strikes Back, opens with the main protagonist, a former soldier, riding a train with their astonishingly stereotypical black sidekick to go fight an evil authority of some description. Wait, a girlfriend impaling second? Haven't we been here before? Well, yes, 12 extremely final times, but the 7th outing more than any other. Of course, Final Fantasy VII didn't fill every cinematic with more shaky cam than a Paul Greengrass film being projected onto a fat jogger's tits. Anyway, after a brief fight that being in control of would have been nice, the gameplay begins, and the game starts as it means to go on by making me run down a linear corridor. This may be a weird thing to pick up on, but the main character's footstep noises are very, very loud. It's like someone's running along just out of shot, banging coconuts together. I wonder if I'll stop noticing it over time. Nope. So far, I've established that the two lead-ish characters are named Lightning and Snow, which are both things that can ruin a picnic. There's also another guy called Hope, as in, I hope we can get these sandwiches back in the car before any snow or lightning happens. It seems we're already assembling the usual Final Fantasy character archetype pick and mix. There's angsty spice, serious spice, manly spice, ethnic spice, and of course the inevitable kooky spice, who deserves special mention because the kookiness of the prerequisite kooky character has now reached some kind of singularity. Her actions don't seem to have any connection to sentient thought or social context. It's like she's got Alzheimer's or something. Anyway, the characters have been introduced but by no means established. I know Final Fantasy always been big on in medias res, but even the most basic questions about the plot remain unanswered. Who the fuck are these people? What is going on? Why should I care? Can I stop playing now? Please. I know what you're gonna say. Yahtzee, please take your dick out of my eye socket. And why are you even reviewing this game when you're on record as a hater of JRPGs and turn-based combat? Well, bitch, prepare to have your mind blown a second time by the fact that I once enjoyed Final Fantasy. Final Fantasy VI, to be precise. I liked how the overarching story could be summarized in less space than a pamphlet, and I liked how the turn-based battles would always come and go very rapidly as if the game was ashamed to be around them. I fell out with JRPGs when they became more about spectacle than substance. Always about skinny 15-year-olds dressed up in outfits that looked like they were designed with an Etch-a-Sketch and then fed through a threshing machine. Endless gaudy cinematics. Retarded angsty drama, bloated unwieldy menu-driven combat, select ability, select attack, select target, wait 5 seconds for the character's brain to start working, repeat. How about we just walk up to the enemy and press one button that bonks him on the head, or am I missing the point? Instead, we have to work around this badly designed interface with long cooldown times between each action, like every warrior and monster on the planet suffers from asthma attacks. Actually, let's harp on the combat some more. It's the massive disconnect between story and gameplay that always gets to me. There's a flashy transition before each fight, so the combat might as well be taking place in some delusional fantasy world brought on by tight hot pants cutting off the flow of blood to the brain. This Hope guy has been established from the start as a whiny, weak, inept, cowardly, socially retarded mummy's boy, so presumably he's the character most of the audience are meant to project onto. But then combat starts, and he literally pulls a boomerang out of his ass and joins the fray. Consistency is nice. Also, Final Fantasy has generally made an effort to mix the combat up with each game, and this time it makes it very clear that it would prefer to involve the player as little as possible. You only control the party leader directly, and even then I just pick auto-attack every round because it's quicker than stacking abilities and I usually just pick the same ones anyway. Later on there's a paradigm system that lets you change the AI behavior in battle, but I still feel my grip on events is rather loose, and it all feels about as involving as Rock'em Sock'em Robots. You know why this game is on 3 discs? Not because it's a complex rollercoaster of an epic, it's because it's padded like a menstruating fire hose. I've spent the entirety of the last 5 hours running down 3 different linear corridors. If this were Modern Warfare, I'd have curb-checked every terrorist in the free world by now. The central plot element has only just been introduced. I only vaguely know what the story's about because I made myself read all that ancillary text log bullshit. This is not good storytelling. You're supposed to weave exposition into the narrative, not hand the audience a fucking glossary as they walk into the theatre. Some people have told me that FF13 gets good about 20 hours. In. You know that's not really a point in its favour, right? Put your hand on a stove for 20 hours, and yeah, you'll probably stop feeling the pain, but you'll have done serious damage to yourself. The story is paced like an ant pushing a brick across a desert. The characters are either completely unlikable or act like they're from space, and the art design is like a painting of a fireworks display. Lots of garish colour and flash, but take one step to the side and you'll see it's completely two-dimensional. I played Final Fantasy XIII because I am an unbiased critic. Shut up, I am! And I must give everything a chance to surprise me. After 5 hours, the only thing that surprised me was how I managed that much without chewing off my
own face. And so we conclude the adventures of Kratos, the ancient world's most determined atheist. He's come so far since God of War 1. The grumpy bastard spent the entire first game acquiring the power to kill just one god, and now he's casually knocking them off like squealing Olympian popcorn. I've always liked Kratos, although I suspect he wouldn't like me because I'm alive. In a medium saturated with generic dark-haired, clear-skinned, hypocritically violent, self-righteous white boys assigned the role of hero by virtue of being the handsomest guy in the plot, usually voiced by Nolan North, it's nice to play an admittedly ugly, hate-ridden fuck with no heroic qualities and who crushes people's skulls against jagged rocks as a form of greeting. I'd like to see Nathan Drake get locked in a room with Kratos, see how far smug wisecracks get him when his head is getting sandwiched between a concrete floor and a foot that kicks so much ass that it permanently smells of fart. Anyway, it's God of War 3, and Kratos is continuing his never-ending quest to seek forgiveness for being such a big murdering bastard, which certainly will be never-ending until he realizes that the first step would be to stop murdering things for 5 minutes. The action picks up at God of War 2's disappointing cliffhanger ending, with Kratos, who never really mentally grew out of the sulky teenager mindset, blaming all his problems on his dad, Zeus. Realizing that the sensible, level-headed thing to do would be to pop up to Mount Olympus and sit down with the guy to discuss their mutual grievances, Kratos instead opts to storm the place with an army of murderous titans and try to ram his sandals down Zeus's beard. At which point the story writer said, "Shit! Whose idea was it to put a thrilling climax at the start of the game? Now I have to contrive some unconvincing way to drag this out for another 6 or 7 hours." Whereupon Kratos falls off the mountain. Whoops, clumsy sod. He dies, goes to Hades, gets stripped of his powers, and has to fight his way out of the underworld, because that's what always happens. Kratos has enough stamps on his Hades loyalty card by now to get a free coffee in damnation. As entertaining as it is to watch Kratos the human liquidizer go about his day job, God of War has only gotten sillier. In God of War 1, Kratos was the closest he's ever been to relatable. Okay, you could murder the odd innocent bystander for health, but they were very screamy and annoying. Kratos was occasionally remorseful rather than crazier than a shark with a can opener, and more importantly didn't seem to be a bigger jerk than the guy he was trying to kill. Fast forward to God of War 3, and Kratos is channeling Judge Death. He murders people who are flat out offering him the things he murders them for. He murders the gods of the sea and the sun, causing untold damage to the world, and all to get his revenge on Zeus. Revenge for what? Stabbing him in the heart in God of War 2? Kratos had walked off that little paper cut inside 10 minutes, fighting his way out of the underworld, Natch. And Zeus only did it because Kratos couldn't stop murdering things. What I'm saying is the quest for redemption thing is starting to ring a bit insincere. There's a whole side plot where you have to rescue a little girl and she reminds Kratos of his dead daughter and that he thinks he can be redeemed through her, all the while still holding the disembodied head of Helios, which he tore off to use as his own personal flashlight. It seems like the heroic thing to do would be to stop playing before Kratos can completely fuck everything up. Gameplay is what I've come to expect from God of War sequels, completely unchanged, full of that faithful old hacko-slasho-button-masho combat where you swing your chains about until everyone around you is missing their front halves. Virtually all the monsters have been airlifted from previous God of Wars and given a HD makeover, so their intestines wobble and glisten realistically as you make them into balloon animals. God of War combat has always been nice and clean and pretty. Well, clean and pretty in a blood-caked Freddy vs. Jason vs. Clash of the Titans sort of way, but it's always had the opposite problem to Dante's Inferno in that it's got a little bit too much variety. The game constantly heaps new weapons and magic spells onto you, but they go unused because the default weapon is the one I've gotten accustomed to and been upgrading all this time. It's like when your nan knits you a jumper for Christmas that looks like a rainbow threw up on a bramble patch, and you have to wear it once or twice to not seem ungrateful before throwing it away. Of the 4 available weapons in God of War 3, 3 of them are chains with spikes on the end. Thanks, Grandma, but I'm okay with chains with spikes on the end. I suppose a bazooka's too much to ask. Of course, the delicious chewy center of God of War lies in its spectacular boss fights, and God of War 3 certainly seems to be doing its best to nostril fuck the PS3 hardware. The point where you kill Kronos is the most spectacular, if a little difficult to believe, considering he's the size of a pregnant aircraft carrier, and realistically you'd need a team of workmen with pneumatic drills just to give the fat bastard a hangnail. That said, the actual challenge of the fight is basically go here, then quick time event, then win, then cake. It seems the smaller the boss gets, the harder the fight, probably because the screen isn't being filled with giant limbs covered in big attack telegraphic Christmas lights, but even the hardest boss doesn't come anywhere near the challenge of the final boss fights from God of War 1, since we're on the PS3 now, the overweight sleepy sheepdog to the PS2's lithe energetic whippet. The puzzles are actually really well designed though. It's nice to see the effort being made to get past push block onto switch, or push sword into face. God of War 3 is fun, I suppose, but I'm not sure why it exists. In God of War 2, your quest was to kill Zeus, and sure enough, at the end of that game, you fight Zeus and almost kill him. In God of War 3, your quest is still to kill Zeus, so basically Kratos has just spent the best part of 2 games largely piddling about, killing the same grunts and dropping in and out of Hades over and over again like he keeps forgetting where he left his fucking wallet. He spent most of the game hunting a mysterious MacGuffin artifact that will help out in some unspecific way, again, but at the end of the game, lo and behold, the power was in you all along, so you might as well have just sat around teabagging Helios for the last 6 hours and gotten the same result. God of War 3 feels like a game that only exists because God of War 2 decided at the last minute not to end properly, and the longer we spend in its world, the more it feels unreal and preposterous, like suddenly noticing that your taxi is being driven by a balloon with a face drawn on it. The term innovative Wii title is about as redundant as an internet cafe in a nudist colony, and it doesn't exactly moisten my bedsheets because innovation has never been the Wii's problem, just dodgy hardware, poor third-party support, and processing power from somewhere around the Battle of Waterloo. The Wii Motion Plus has solved one of those issues, and after the bland, happy-clappy casual gamer feeding trough of Wii Sports Resort, it's finally time for a hardcore title to make use of the technology. It would be churlish of me to dwell on how long it's taken for the Wii to start sucking less, which is why I'm going to do so. 3.5 years, roundabout, Nintendo, that's decent speed for for a fucking glacier. But anyway, here's Red Steel 2, and I've got to admit, this is probably the best motion-controlled combat I've seen on the Wii. Of course, it still isn't very good. It's like being the best at jerking off to your sister in the shower. You only won because no one else entered, and you probably shouldn't have been doing it in the first place. You may recall that Red Steel 1 was a launch title intended to showcase the Wii's potential as a hardcore gaming platform, and was so miserably awful it was like cutting off your own head to showcase your potential as an umbrella stand. Red Steel 2 follows on from the first game, but takes the perspective of a different character, in a different setting, time period, and art style with completely different gameplay. Okay, so it's completely unrelated, but since Red Steel 1 had little in the way of redness or steel, I'd suggest just calling this new one Red Steel and retroactively renaming the first game. Ubisoft did a whoopsie in its pants. Red Steel 2 is a slightly Tarantino-esque amalgamation of Western and Samurai story about a bloke who comes to some city in the desert, apparently for a cosplay convention, and who gets beaten up by bullies for his big gay red coat, and who vows to fight back against them in a convenient ascending order of strength. And it has a cel-shaded art style, because this is the Wii processor we're talking about, and it's either that or looking like an episode of Reboot. Unlike most Wii games, where the various Wii flails could easily be exchanged for pressing buttons on a nice traditional controller, and you wouldn't have to look like you're slap-fighting your imaginary friend, Red Steel 2's sword combat actually needs the motion sensor. You have to slash, thrust, and block in various ways to break and counter corresponding enemy strikes and blocks, and swipe wider and faster for strong armor-breaking attacks. And if there are a lot of armored dudes around, then there's no faster way to dislocate your shoulder besides maybe jerking off a wind farm. However, the marriage between Wiimote flinging sword slashes and pointing at the screen to aim and look around is an unhappy one, with lots of furniture breaking and milkman fucking. Try to turn around too fast and you might end up seriously menacing a nearby pot plant, and since in sword fights I usually hold the sword vertically, whenever a fight ends my character immediately looks up into the sky as if the murdering has made him suddenly introspective. The game has a sort of hub-based mission structure, but since the missions are all given in a strictly linear order anyway, its only purpose is to mercilessly pad out the time you spend in these semi-desert ghost towns until you acquire a conditioned hatred for Team Fortress 2 maps. It just means having to traipse back to the mission room after doing everything to get a pat on the head and a biscuit from your sensei, who will more often than not teach you a new technique. Now, it must be said, Nintendo really don't think much of you. The fact that they actually released Wii Music rather than, say, murdered the creator and burned all his writing speaks well enough to that. Not only does Red Steel 2 insist upon making you play a tutorial for every single new move you learn, but it won't be satisfied until you can demonstrate it 5 or 6 times, and it shows a little video of a non-threatening attractive young white person doing the motions in case you jammed a sensor bar up your nose and forgot what words mean. Together with the fact that the game literally forces you to watch a 5-minute video in which a lady explains how to use the Wii Motion Plus to her dyslexic 2-year-old, it makes me wonder why Nintendo releases products at all if they're afraid we'll all decapitate ourselves with the warranty cards. Red Steel shares the increasingly common problem that a poorly implemented upgrade system bends the difficulty curve over a snooker table and labours exhaustively at its upper thigh region. You start off the game as a mewling schoolgirl flailing your switchblade comb at the ankles of the big lads, and by the end of it, you're plowing through them so hard they barely have time to give a contemptuous guffaw before their tongue waggles gurglingly at the spot where the upper portion of their heads used to be. A game has to balance player upgrades with increased enemy threats. While you're learning 500 ways to put a bit of shiny metal between someone's ears and sellotaping new bits of armor to your coat, the enemy aren't doing much more than figuring out how to block basic attacks. And about halfway through, you learn a special move called the Tiger, and the game is officially over, bar a few more hours of shoulder exercise. It's a block that stops any attack and immediately breaks the enemy's guard, leaving them open to becoming the deadest thing since sliced bread, and this applies to any enemy attack, including bosses. It's like setting the cat among the pigeons, and the cat has an assault rifle. And this is the sort of game where pocket change flies out of broken pot plants, so while not needing them in the slightest, I bought all the life and armor upgrades because there weren't any sounder investment opportunities for the 200 grand in my pocket, and then I was just a tuft of flesh bobbing around somewhere inside a ball of unbreakable steel and leather. Thinking back about Red Steel 2, my memories blur together somewhat. A dreamlike haze of orange scenery and acoustic guitar, sprinkled with arbitrary samey gang fights with Jason Voorhees' samurai friends. After a while, the awful dialogue and mission briefing started to sound like the adults in the Charlie Brown and Snoopy show, and I fell into a trance following the little green arrow like it was a carrot on the end of a fishing rod, winning fights and completing missions with no difficulty or understanding. While the shell around the swordplay mechanic is a rather empty and uninteresting one, I will admit that the swordplay itself is quite invigorating in a way that using a normal controller wouldn't be, but my question is this: what other kinds of hardcore gameplay could the Wii Motion Plus possibly be used for? What else besides sword fighting combines a life-threatening scenario with holding a straight object at different angles for various situations? Because all I can think of is being an air traffic controller at the Hindenburg disaster. How to be a video games journalist, lesson 37. Using game titles for puns and cutting Swiftian jibes. A game name like Just Cause is absolute gold for the reviewer, since it can mean both a just cause, a righteous agenda, or the phrase just because, a dismissive explanation of whimsical or reckless behaviour. The opportunity for puns is obvious. Why would you steal a passenger jet and fly it directly up the bumhole of a sunbathing prostitute? Just cause. Praise and large quantities of gamer pussy will swiftly follow. However, this pun is so obvious that every game journalist and their cat and their cat's squeaky toy will have used it, so you may have to postmodernly draw attention to that fact at the start of your review so everyone assumes you're using the joke ironically. Remember, the ironic gamer pussy is just as soft and lovely as the regular kind. Next week on How to Be a Video Games Journalist, digging out your higher brain functions with the end of a ballpoint pen. Just Cause 2 is a sandbox game in which CIA operative and immortal physics-defying wizard Rico Rodriguez is inserted into some kind of Southeast Asian dictatorship to destabilize it with his giant exploding testicles. Why? Just cause. Truth be told, I never quite figured out why, not that a reason is needed. Asking players to go into a sandbox game and cause chaos and destruction is like asking a cat to lie on somebody's face while they're trying to sleep. Mind you, calling Just Cause 2 a sandbox is like saying the Boston Strangler was a bit of a weirdo. If you can imagine a sandbox about 35 kilometers along each side, with enough sand to fill the Simpson Desert and have enough left over to irritate the vaginas of every hooker in Vegas, where you'd need an army of archaeologists working round around the clock to find all the cat turds and broken glass. That's the kind of sandbox Just Cause 2 is going for. You can motorbike along the coast for hours admiring the scenery, then you ramp off a peasant farmer's hat, send your bike flying through someone's living room, then reenact the massacre on a government soldier's face. Why? Just cause. 2. It's a good thing I'm sick of realistic shooters, because Just Cause 2's relationship with realism is limited to a fleeting farewell peck on the cheek before leaping aboard Leprechaun Flight 101 to the dark side of Mars. Warlock Master of Time and Space, Rico Rodriguez, has a magic momentum-cancelling hookshot that can propel him onto any surface within range, and he also possesses the ability to pull unlimited numbers of parachutes literally out of his arse. And he doesn't even need them to break his fall, because he can hookshot into the ground when you're close enough and escape unharmed. That's right, the best way to survive smacking into concrete at terminal velocity is to smack into it slightly faster. Maybe it's a homeopathic thing. A sandbox is all very well, but unless it's fun to actually get around it, then all you're doing is giving the player a commute between every mission. Just Cause 2 understands that. You could drive to your next objective in a family sedan if you've got an afternoon free, or you could skyjack a military jet, point at the nearest tall building, stand on the nose cone, and surf it all the way into the cafeteria. Why? Fucked if I know! Just Cause 2 is a game for fucking around. You unlock story missions by doing the side missions, and you unlock side missions by blowing shit up, so the fucking around is what holds everything together, like the chocolate around a Twix. It's just that the rest of the Twix has been chewed up a bit and got back onto the plate, because the actual missions are rather slapdash. The worst part of the game is the stronghold missions, which are required to unlock more territory, because they're all as routine as brushing your teeth. Break into a base, 2-3. Give everyone a bullet pasty, 3-4. Shoot down a helicopter, and bam, another Kentucky Fried Revolution open for business. Applaudable in a way, making wanton destruction boring takes some real effort. The other side missions are all nicely varied, if a little arbitrary. A mission where you blow up an entire compound, steal a jet, and shoot down a space rocket in midair gives roughly the same reward as a mission where you snipe someone's cat out of a tree. The story missions feel a little unfocused, since most of the story is basically keep blowing shit up, and everything that passes for a boss fight shrivels pathetically in the face of Rico Rodriguez, the legendary son of Zeus and a Hispanic window cleaner. There's this one incredibly sharp-witted boss who attacks you with a satellite missile system while standing on the same narrow rooftop as you. Didn't even have to shoot the stupid bastard. It would have practically been assisted suicide. I tell you what, if I ever planned to patch this game, item 1 on page 1, inscribed in flaming gold dust by the fucking Pope, would be this. Please let me buy more than one thing at a time. Guns are hard to get hold of outside missions. You'd almost think high-powered killing devices are being strictly regulated, so you have to buy them from the black market. That means calling your contact, a cutscene for the chopper shopper to come down, picking what to buy, then another cutscene for the chopper to drop it off. So if you're getting ready for a night on the town and want 10 satchel bombs, a sports car to stick them all to, and a sniper rifle to pick off the survivors, then you need to go through all that 3 times. And since the chopper pilot sounds like a freshly lobotomized Yosemite Sam, I'm ready to stuff my herniated eardrums down the voice actor's throat. The second item, written in silver dust by the Pope's cat, would be having vehicle upgrades applied to all vehicles of that type and not just ones you buy from Chopper Chopper mail order. Collecting vehicle upgrades is one of the main exploration quests, but buying vehicles eats up money very fast, and there are tons available for free, that is, driven by squishy mortals. Yeah, you can buy an expensive jet, but do you really think you're going to use it more than once? Landing it would require finesse that's a bit beyond Rico, because it doesn't involve anything getting murdered. At the end of the day, Just Cause 2 is fun. It's not very challenging. Between magic space hookshot and parachute farting, it's almost like playing with all the cheats on, especially since most enemies have the preservation instincts of a chip sandwich. As I said, the game map is willy-shrivelingly huge, but it's kind of too big. You could get through about 5 conventional games in the travel time alone, and it doesn't take long to find that a lot of the locations have the air of the clone brush about them. If you intend to go for 100% completion, then firstly it's going to quickly feel like a grind, and secondly, don't handle any sharp objects, because you're clearly mad as a ferret sausage. The story and dialogue are absolute tripe on a bike, but apparently I'm the only one who cares. At the end of the day, again, it's fun to hookshot a guy in the throat, yank him off a ledge, and drag him behind your car as you drive through a cactus patch. Some might say that's enough. Some might say I'm too hard to please, but some can shut their fucking mouths.
You know, Nintendo, if you ever want me to stop hating on the Wii, then the first thing to do would be to make it stop kicking me in the balls. Red Steel 2 was a step in the right direction, a small and shaky step made by a drunk dog onto the surface of a recently frozen lake, but a step forward at least. A positive second step would be to find a way to localize games for the PAL regions in slightly less than a human lifetime. I only just got hold of Silent Hill Shattered Memories, but to American viewers, this is practically going to be a retro review. And No More Heroes 2 isn't out for another month. What the hell are you people doing to these games that take so fucking long? Re-rendering every scene so that the characters stick their pinky fingers out when holding cups of tea? Well, better late than never, I suppose, unless you're an electric chair repairman, so here's Shattered Memories. A new Silent Hill game was recently announced, so this is sort of topical. Yes, let's go with that. Shattered Memories is technically a remake of Silent Hill 1, in the same way that a dog biting off your dick is technically foreplay. You play a bloke called Harry Mason, and you're looking for your daughter in a town that has trouble remembering if it's a completely shitty holiday destination or just a mostly shitty one. And that's where the similarities with the original end. It's snow instead of fog, the backstory of the town is completely different, and Harry has better voice acting than a fucking breakfast cereal mascot. Now, this is everything a reboot should be, one that's not afraid to fix shit that didn't work. Taking things in a new direction that refers to the original without feeling it has to clamp its lips around its big fat cock and suck all its internal organs out through its urethra. urethra. Thank fuck they've gotten rid of that stupid evil cult business that's been hanging over this otherwise excellent series like a parasol of frozen turd. The horror of a formless, unknowable evil is diminished when you attach a human face to it. Humans are reasonable, they wear underpants, go to the toilet, eat crisps, get their sleeves caught on doorknobs. I feel that the best horror antagonists are ones you could never imagine doing the gardening or going shopping for pyramid-shaped helmets. The unique feature of the game is that it psychologically profiles you as you play, altering itself to fuck with your head better, which I was dubious about. Who you are in a game is a very different person to who you are in real life, a sort of high-functioning autistic you probably wouldn't want to leave your children with. If I go into a lady's lavatory, for example, in real life it would be to sniff the seats for some illicit sexual thrill, but in a game it's because I want to make sure someone didn't leave first aid kits in the cisterns. But regardless, I played through twice, firstly doing what came naturally, and secondly trying to do the opposite of that. Got the same ending anyway, so the game may be cleverer than I thought. Some characters were wearing different clothes, though, not sure how that works. Oh, I don't find that red dress very intimidating, but oh fuck, a pink dress, shit's getting real! At the end of the game, you also get a little analysis of your personality, though I'm not convinced it's not just a random selection of newspaper horoscopes. After my first playthrough, it declared I was fastidiously clean and tidy, which is true, that when there are three garbage bags in the kitchen waiting to be taken down to the bins, I can't rest until they've been diligently ignored. Family-oriented, which explains why I live 12,000 miles away from anyone remotely related to me and never write, and possibly crap in bed. Moving on, the levels are extremely linear, but do indulge in the kind of appealing surreality that characterised Silent Hill at its peak, but the problem with Shattered Memories, besides reading me mostly, I mean completely wrong, is that it's not scary. And for a horror game, that's a pretty fucking massive problem. That's a 300-pound problem with a pimply underbelly and severe flatulence. Monsters only show up when you enter the ice-covered dark world, so you're 100% sure to be completely safe as long as your surroundings don't look like the night God drank his Slurpee too fast. When they are around, you can't fight, just run away, which sounded like a great idea to me. Combat in Silent Hill games has always been like fighting with your arms stuck in buckets of wallpaper paste, and it's scarier to be weaponless and desperate. That is, assuming the monsters chasing you are themselves more threatening than a wheelchair-bound elderly woman on a fire escape. They're scampering wooden dollies, squealing at you like pigs doing impressions of Jamie Lee Curtis. It's like you're being chased by nagging housewives brandishing rolling pins. They're not trying to stab you or cough acid in your face, they only want to give you a cuddle, and you can just throw them off again with a Wemo flail. It's like a simulation of Robert Pattinson trying to walk through a room full of fat 15-year-old girls. I only got overwhelmed once or twice because the Wemo decided to get all prima donna on me and stop registering my flail, so once again the biggest threat in a Wii game is the hard wear. And even then I only got teleported back to the start of the section. Fuck, why don't you just give me a fond slap on the bum and send me on my way? Oh yeah, and there are cupboards to hide in if all the squeaking cuddly toys get too much for you. And why not change into an elegant frock while you're in there because you are a girl? Most glaringly of all, the dark world is both fairly evenly lit and blue. Blue is a calming colour. You don't paint the giant leering face of Oliver Reed on a nursery ceiling. I don't think there's even any blood in the game. Well, there's a bit. Someone coughs it up at one point, so that's what, a quarter of a pint? That's a poor amount for a fucking episode of Thundercats. What I'm saying is that there's very little that's grotesque about the game, and subtracting the wet, sticky, icky factor from Silent Hill is like pulling the fangs out of a skinless zombie dog. It's a psychological horror experience that tripped over the whole horror aspect, and I can't even honestly vouch for the psychological bit when it seems they could get an equally accurate reading by throwing darts at a wall. Even if it does read you right, it doesn't create a customised horror landscape so much as a visualisation of a fortune cookie paper. So dropping the psychological and the horror bit, all we have left is an experience. Not a bad experience, mind. It's a fun little story, well told, and vastly more interesting than other Neuro Silent Hills. It stands proud and tall over Origins and Homecoming, and next to Silent Hill the arcade game, it's like a firmly built brick house next to a dog poo. Besides being the smallest possible unit of mutant rat karate master, Splinter Cell is a series of stealth games under the Tom Clancy label, although one suspects that Tom Clancy himself had as much to do with the development of Splinter Cell Conviction as Tom Clancy's Goldfish. But if there's one thing that characterises his games, it's that they always seem to be about someone trying to take over the United States. Speaking as a foreigner, who the fuck would want to take over the United States? It'd be like trying to keep a giant diseased ape in your apartment that eats money and suffers from life-threatening obesity and constant diarrhea, but viciously savages you every time you try to give it free healthcare. I have a fondness for stealth games, but I've never been into Splinter Cell as much as Thief or Hitman. I've never quite bought that Sam Fisher, a man bearing a close resemblance to a shaved bear with glowing eyes, is the greatest stealth operative ever. Maybe if all the other ones wear saucepans on their feet, and in official media he's supposed to be 5'8". Fuck off! Maybe if everyone else were an Oompa Loompa. So in the previous game, Sam Fisher's daughter was laid up with a bad case of dead. It was a fairly pivotal moment of character development that led to him going deep undercover, but we should know by now that there's no unconnected personal tragedy that sequel writers can't shoehorn into a conspiracy theory somewhere down the line. Having saved the free world once again, Sam is in hiding somewhere, either because everyone forgot to write down that he was an undercover agent, or because he wants to be spared the embarrassing congratulations party when he's attacked by thugs, learns there might have been more to his daughter's death, and becomes embroiled in the fight against a sinister conspiracy being carried out by the new head of Sam's old company, who intends to become president by killing the old one, because that's how politics works. Note that Sam only finds out about the conspiracy after it sends thugs to kill him, so the baddies said to themselves, hey, the one guy who could threaten our operation is in a different country and isn't the slightest bit interested in our stupid conspiracy. Fuck that, let's go shoot at him. Now I know why Sam Fisher is the best stealth operative ever, because everyone else in the world is a fucking retard. God. And the more I play, the more evidence I find for this supposition. The enemy AI must have been dropped on its head as a subroutine. Here is a brief list of things that these professional soldiers, guards, and career mercenaries have never been trained not to do. Stand facing each other and jabber about how much they hate democracy and apple pie and the smiles on little babies' faces instead of guarding the fucking room. Give away their position every five paces by screaming out personal insults at the professional killer they can't see but know for a fact is in the room, currently training his sights at their big flapping potty mouths. After catching a glimpse of said professional killer, unload every clip they have at the spot where he used to be, with their backs to about 12 different entry points, and walk around in circles repeatedly checking for the professional killer in the same square yard of floor space, loudly announcing their discoveries with each revolution. Of course, none of this eclipses the stupidity of going up against Sam Fisher in the first place, when he's the one who got most of the solitary brain cell that everyone had to share, but if the AI is thick as pig shit, then it's an esteemed professor of pig shit compared to what the game thinks the player is like. It must have been designed for a member of the royal family, because everything is done for you. It feels like I'm controlling a little man riding on Sam Fisher's back rather than Sam Fisher himself. You move from cover to cover by pointing Sam at the spot you want to move to and giving him a slap on the back of the head. The melee kill? Stand next to someone and press B. Doesn't matter how alert he is or where he's facing or how many bullets he just put in Sam's midriff, press B, dead. And doing melee kills lets you use the execute function, wherein you point out two or three baddies whose faces you particularly don't like, give Sam another slap, and he will shoot them all for you. This is like that power-up in Mario that lets you skip a bunch of levels, unless you've got a school report on the game's ending sequence due in 1 hour, all it does is cheat you out of gameplay. There's a range of guns and the usual upgrade system that's about as necessary as a waterproof camel, but it raises two questions. Why would I ever want a non-silenced gun, and why would I want a silenced machine gun when pistols fire as quickly as your index finger can allow and have infinite ammo? Where's he keeping that, Ubisoft? In his shoes? Wait, let my head break the surface of hatred for a moment to say that I like how you take cover by holding down a button. That works pretty well. Right, back down again. The context-sensitive actions are as fiddly as a fiddler crab fiddling with his tax return. To jump up a wall, you have to be pointing directly at the specific point on the wall that makes a tiny little jump prompt appear. Otherwise, Sam might get confused, as he did when I was playing, and instead mistakenly open a nearby door to a brightly lit room full of terrorists playing Hungry Hungry Hippos. Forget what I said earlier, Sam can be filed under retard as well, so that's the protagonist, the enemies, and the player all together in a big retard jamboree. I'd hate to think where the developers live that's given them this impression of human intelligence. Wait a sec, Ubisoft Montreal? Well, that explains it. As I said, I like stealth games. Kicking the door in and holding down fire until all organic matter in the room has fused with the wallpaper feels like it should be a last resort, while getting in and out unnoticed is the real show of skill. So why has Splinter Cell never really hit my stealth spot? I still don't know. It could be because it always tends to be a linear succession of stealth encounters when my favourite stealth games like Thief 2 and Hitman Blood Money offer open-ended sprawling levels, letting you choose to burst in the front, sneak in the back, or come down the chimney dressed as Father Christmas, but I've never had a problem with linearity before. It could be because it's fun letting guards live, so after you've gone you can picture them impotently stomping on their hats in fury, but in Splinter Cell Conviction you're expected to cap them in the head anyway, which only feels like a step above the wallpaper option. Whatever the case, Conviction is a disappointingly short and insubstantial installment. If the series so far is a stream of urine, then Conviction is the last drop that goes down your leg. Have I mentioned that I wrote a novel and you can pre-order it from Amazon and Amazon.co.uk? Well, I wrote a novel and you can pre-order it from Amazon and Amazon.co.uk. So I ventured from my cave to pick up Dead to Rights Retribution, probably with latex gloves and the longest pair of tongs I could find, when I noticed a game on the new release shelves I'd never heard of. A Square Enix game, apparently populated with characters who dress themselves by running at full speed into the bin behind a fetish shop. Exactly the sort of thing you'd expect Square Enix to be proud of, but it's flown completely under the radar. I asked everyone I knew, and neither of them had heard of it either. Ooh, I thought, this mystery intrigues me, and if Dead to Rights Retribution is anything like the first Dead to Rights, I could probably simulate it just as well by shooting execution style a few people with funny accents. So fuck it, let's see if it's a hidden gem or a petrified arsehole they were hoping could scoot by unnoticed. Since then, I've played through Nier, and I must say, it's gratifying to see that the game is named after the sound I make when asked to describe it. Nier is in actuality the name of the main character, the guy on the box who looks a bit like Emmett Brown, wearing his underpants on his face. I only found this out later, though, because before the game tells you his name, it asks you if you can come up with a better one, and thus began the adventures of Twatty Cake, Defender of the Innocent. Twatty Cake is a middle-aged village handyman who is seeking a cure for his daughter's mysterious disease that makes incomprehensible writing appear on her body, which is exactly the excuse I gave my mum when I got back from the tattoo shop. I must say, it's nice to see a Square Enix RPG where the main character isn't a skinny emo child whose balls are still in his fucking neck, although there is still plenty of angst to go around. The other members of your party are an angsty leprechaun version of Jack Skellington and an angsty lady whose angst apparently stems from a question mark hanging over the whole lady thing. Or should I say, hanging under? I know outfits in JRPGs tend to lean towards the fetishistic, but I swear they're just trying to see what they can get away with now. The woman's combat gear is a jock strap and a negligee. Someone should probably call them out on this, or the next game will have a heroine going into battle in nothing but high heels and three bits of masking tape. Insert name here is Combat, as if the hacky slash slashy variety. Swinging the weapons feels a bit gluey at times, but overall it's functional if uninteresting, like former Prime Minister John Major. Although what is interesting is that enemy magic attacks take a cue from bullet hell shooters, of all things, filling the room with row after row of deadly spheres like a long-distance teabagging, turning gameplay into more like navigating an organic maze of glow testicles than dodging bullets, except that the block move renders them harmless, so much for that. There's a bit of a difficulty problem overall. Twatty Cake has a variety of his own magic attacks that are about as balanced as entering an orc at a cockfight, especially the one that lets you pause the game, point at an enemy, and summon the ethereal equivalent of a tactical nuclear strike. Even the final bosses got their shit ruined with the most basic armor-breaking attacks, and after maxing out on healing items and the best weapons, I still had 100 grand kicking around. What else am I supposed to spend this money on, game? Maintaining the back garden? Oh, yes, apparently. You know how in some RPGs you start off in your lovely idyllic green grass home village where smiling neighbours bid you how do you do, and which is virtually guaranteed to get Hiroshima-fied before the second act? Well, Nier is like that, but never quite gets as far as the second bit. Frankly, I wish it would. Here we have a stalwart fighter who, in between fighting cosmic death beasts from beyond the veil of time and space, has to repeatedly run back home to water his melons, spend quality time with his child, and see if anyone needs him to run down the shops to buy them a healing potion and a Mars bar. It's one of those games that seeks to challenge the notion that gamers need to get a life by attempting to simulate one. As well as planting and harvesting crops for about 1/100th of the profit margin to be found in monster murdering, there's also a fishing minigame, which is about as fun as digging hooks into your own gums, and of course the fetch quest, since you're the only person in town who can read shopping lists. I suppose in the game's defense, while it does force you back to the home village every half hour like it's ringing a service bell, you don't have to do anything when you get there. Although I did get pangs of guilt when I saw the ocean of floating speech bubbles hovering over the helpless townsfolk whose feet were apparently encased in cement. One game I'm also reminded of is Zelda, for Zelda is only one game with about 50 different dresses. It has a similar overworld dungeon structure, and one of the bosses bears such a close resemblance to a boss from Zelda Wind Waker that it's either a deliberate homage or a sign that the games industry needs to go to its room and seriously think about what it's doing. And something it has in common with Zelda Twilight Princess is that someone leant too hard on the bloom button. It's like all you have to do is walk into a tunnel and the sun goes supernova. Maybe this explains why Twatty Cake takes to wearing his pants over his eyes. Anyway, Nier was presumably working with less of a budget than Zelda and rapidly recycles like air crash survivors in the mountains. You go through maybe 4 dungeons and the action skips ahead 5 years for no apparent reason, which everyone presumably spends sitting around in their pants waiting to figure out the next course of action, which turns out to be go to the same 4 dungeons again. All the while listening to the same fucking 10-second music loops over and over again, which are all now playing in the elevators of my personal hell. And there's a pretty fucking glaring budget cut at one point where a dungeon is replaced by a series of text screens. Seriously, I didn't buy a PS3 to play Zork, bitch. Nier has the bones of a half-decent action RPG in here somewhere, but bones are only good as long as you drink your milk and avoid throwing yourself down flights of stairs. The combat is alright, and story and characters are somewhat above average if a little enamoured with glurgy power of friendship drama, but there's too much fat wobbly wrapping paper around the good bits. Explain to me the appeal of a weapon and magic upgrade system where you have to go down your list of spells and weapons, applying the same upgrade to all of them individually like ticking a fucking school register. It's a game that paradoxically cuts down its adventure content while leaving room for stupid fucking gardening and spoon-feeding retarded villagers. Perhaps there was some cock-up at the budget meeting and fun got allocated less money than the knobbing around department. There were bits of it that were so boring I almost had a near-death experience. Boosh! When it comes to naming your sequel, there are a couple of routes you can take. The more old-fashioned among us just put a number on the end, but that makes the property sound like the name of a planet or a video games console. Others use the increasingly popular method of just using the same title as before, unchanged, if they want to fuck with people's filing systems. Still others use the same title, but add on a word beginning with RE, as in Matrix Revolutions, Alien Resurrection, or indeed Dead to Rights Retribution, which isn't technically a sequel since the plot starts out the same as the first game. So perhaps a better name would have been Dead to Rights Remake, or perhaps Dead to Rights Revisionism. Let's just hope it doesn't end up Dead to Rights Retarded. That would be Dead to Rights Regrettable. In case you never played the first game, here's a Dead to Rights recap. Bang, punch, bang, punch, bang, punch, woof! It's the kind of over-the-top, balls-to-the-teeth action that I honestly can't tell if it's being deliberately camp or if it was written by a paranoid NRA member shaking off a debilitating addiction to horse tranquilizers. You play the preposterously named Jack Slate, a cop so close to the edge he has to wear a safety harness, who surgically implants rare stakes into his muscles, and who missed a golden opportunity when he chose policing rather than opening a roofing business. Someone murdered his father, so he's out searching for answers, and he's letting his gun do the talking, and his gun only knows one very loud word. Without wishing to spoil anything, the central moral of Dead to Rights Reprimand is that gung-ho militant violence cannot be allowed to replace old-fashioned by-the-book arrest and trial, and forgive me if that moral seems a bit insincere coming from Jack Slate, who spends the entire game murdering gangs, anyone complicit in gang crime, and anyone who happens to be standing next to them. At one point, Jack demonstrates his commitment to due process by pledging to escort a main bad guy to the police station rather than kill him, 30 seconds later using him as a human shield to gun down all his bodyguards. I feel Jack is following the letter rather than the spirit of the law, a law completely unique to Jack Slate, given to him by some kind of mad ocelot god that only he can see. Speaking of things that are morally iffy, I'd like to see Jack blank slate filling out his Dead to Rights reports afterwards, trying to explain why he gunned down blatantly unarmed men as they ran towards him. The game's intention is to allow seamless switching between gunplay and unarmed combat. In this world, having a gun in a close-range encounter is a liability, since all the guns have been smeared with butter and anyone can be very swiftly disarmed. And when Jack does it, the victim obligingly stares dopely at their Dead to Rights recently vacated hands for a second while you cap them right up the left nostril. It's good balance, but it does create this weird Dead to Rights recurring situation wherein melee-focused enemies will completely stop giving a shit and break cover to sprint into melee range across open ground and in direct line of fire. And then once you realise that you have the Dead to Rights resilience of a gritty, spiky-haired fridge, Jack starts doing it as well. Overall, we're not painting a picture of good mental health care in Grand City. Not that Jack Slater's ever been a stranger to the People's Republic of Mad Bodia and its principal exports of mixed nuts and batshit. When he runs, the camera does this sickening wobble back and forth, which would be really effective in some kind of psychological horror game where the protagonist has gone into paranoid hysterics. Some people get motion sickness just from regular games, the pussies. I'd hate to see one of those guys playing this, or the state of the upholstery afterwards. Even in cover, I was constantly getting hit by stray shots because Jack's manorexia ensured he couldn't leave the gym until his upper body was the size and shape of an entire litter of pit bulls lashed together. And then, of course, there are the takedowns. When you've beaten up a debatably bad guy enough, you can press a button to teleport both he and Jack to a little pocket dimension where pain is God and Jack Slate is Pope. Then he watched Jack work out his daddy issues on a drug dealer's spine for about 10 worryingly vicious seconds while patiently waiting for that whole game thing to Dead to Rights resume. And considering that Jack's body count eventually matches the attendance figures of a Justin Bieber concert, that's a fuckload of Dead to Rights repetitive visits to the pain dimension. Is there not someone else in this game I could play? Someone who in the real world would not be banned from owning anything sharper than a crayon? Fortunately, you do control someone else, or should I say, someone dog. Jack's pedigree chum Shadow has been upgraded from his previous role in Dead to Rights 1 as a sort of dog-shaped ballistic missile to full-on NPC support, which means he runs around getting shot and you have to Dead to Rights revive him every now and again, but what do you want? He's a dog. And also, you occasionally control him for brief stealth sections, which are probably the most interesting part of the game. I've got shelves full of games where I can play some knucklehead popping at some identical knucklehead from behind a bit of wall, but fewer I can be a sneaky and adorable hunter with a taste for scrotums, although with the ability to see through walls, which dogs apparently have, it does tend to be a little too easy. And of course, we find out what Jack and Shadow see in each other when you find that Shadow's kill animations are just as lengthy and psychotic, which not only ruins any thought I might have of playing frisbee in the park with the big fuzzy sweetheart, but it makes it likelier that other guards can turn around and spot you before you can drag the body away. But I suppose the number of gangbanger dicks you've ripped off is something you probably want to keep careful track of if you're Buffalo fucking Bill. I do sincerely hope Dead to Rights Recidivism is deliberately trying to be camp, because it most certainly is. All it needs is to show Jack Slate's walking calmly away from an explosion while putting on a pair of sunglasses. The seamless dual mode combat is fast paced and competently executed, but aside the occasional stealth bit, never really evolves past that. And it's most definitely not the sort of game you'd show to someone to prove that, no really, gaming is becoming totally mature and sophisticated. Puts a burlap sack on Jack Slate's head and it qualifies as a slasher movie. It's all so juvenile to be enjoyed by slack-jawed teenagers, acne bursting with glee at every ravenous cock gobble as they fondle their switchblades and fantasize about slitting up their dads. I've come up with a great title for the next sequel though, Dead to Rights Really. Really, 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 really dumb. Have I mentioned that I wrote a novel and you can pre-order it from Amazon and Amazon.co.uk? Well, I wrote a novel and you can pre-order it from Amazon and Amazon.co.uk.
Hello, my name is Rebecca Mays. I am writing a song about Yahtzee. A love song, in fact. I need your help if you have any lyric suggestions, any musical ideas, anything that really needs to go in this song to let Yahtzee know what you really think of him. Let me know on my Facebook page. I want it to be really good.
I don't think I'll ever understand the Japanese games market. Not the sex games, those I understand. Even the visual novel thing. I don't need more complex gameplay phases between me and titties. It's the visual novels that don't have titties that confuse me. So now we're going to be removing the cream from a cream and dog shit slice. And then there's those Japanese games like Harvest Moon, where all you do is be productive and respect nature and never raise so much of a finger against another living creature of God's kingdom. What an incredibly backward notion. Perhaps it points to the comparative immaturity of modern culture that mainstream audiences will only tolerate an alternative gaming experience as long as bits of it explode every now and again. But you know what? The Dalai Lama could bang a magic gong that makes everyone on Earth enlightened as all fucks, that the simple act of growing a single flower with your own time and loving attention creates paroxysms of ecstasy, and Monster Hunter Tri wouldn't be any less fucking tedious. The box art of the game depicts a giant roaring monster gasping in disbelieving horror at his little human friend who has shown up at the monster opera in last season's armor. The opening pre-rendered cinematic depicts a sort of battle royale between various species of roaring monster. As it turns out, neither of those things are strongly reflective of the game's content. I never saw any monsters fighting each other. The only truly accurate part of the cinematic is right at the end when a load of humans show up and don't get to do shit. You play an adventurer type showing up at the prerequisite village of immobile retards in a time when dinosaurs ruled the earth to try to be a hunter of monsters. A monster hunter try, if you will. It's a sort of cross between a fantasy RPG and one of those deer hunting simulators that sell really well in the American states that the other American states prefer not to acknowledge. It's probably a fairly accurate portrayal of what 99% of an adventurer type's actual life would be like when there aren't any adventures or anything interesting happening, and I'm not saying there'd be no audience for that, but I wouldn't want to be stuck in conversation with it at a dull party. Perhaps a better title for this game would have been Monster Hunter Gatherer, since finding resources in the field is about as central as the game mechanics get. As well as from dead monsters, a whole homeless lady's shopping trolley's worth of miscellaneous crap can be acquired from nests, insect hives, bits of rock and plant life, and I hope you brought some suitably impressive armor for your big day of skipping through the forest picking flowers. Actually, speaking of the title, we should probably drop the word monster as well, since you usually just kill blameless wildlife that only attacks because you're invading its territory or because you just pushed a sharpened stick down the ear of its favorite child. But I guess calling it hunter-gatherer of innocent young dinosaurs pathetically mewling their last as the memory of their mother's warmth drifts away to be replaced by the unforgiving coldness of... Oh fuck it, let's just call it You Bastard. The reason for all this is to sell resources for gold, develop the village, and craft upgrades for your weapons and armor, although that's just the middle phase. The ultimate goal of item gathering is, I suspect, to gather more items until you've collected all the different kinds. It's like Pokemon, except all the Pokemon are bits of old twig and horn and samples of fluid extracted from an antelope's bollocks. The crafting system makes me fearful and paranoid, because it's impossible to tell if it's safe to flog that blob of rare worm spunk or if it's going to be an integral part of the next upgrade for your favorite sledgehammer, meaning another tiresome grind in the worm cave where the worms have all of a sudden come over all coy and started dropping nothing but clumps of nostril hair. You may think this game is starting to sound like all the very worst parts of a Mamorburger clumped together into a big horrible gelatinous mass, but wait, there's also the quest system. For extra money and resources, you can take timed quests to either kill a certain number of a certain kind of monster or gather a certain number of a certain resource that can only be gathered from things that provide some other resource 90% of the time. So yes, it is just the very worst parts of a Mamorburger clumped together into a big horrible gelatinous mass, so grab a spoon and open wide. The odd thing about quests is rather than being given a shopping list to maybe think about while running around the overworld, when you start a quest, you're locked into a special version of the overworld that exists only for that quest and aren't allowed out until you're finished. It's almost bureaucratic, a sort of forced structure that a middle manager might come up with after a 3-day database convention. It was while on one of these quests that I was swimming around on the ocean floor looking for a certain kind of sea sponge that the blacksmith needed to rub on my sword to unlock its true potential, when a gigantic fucking sea monster appeared and tried to eat me. Holy Christ, the 3-day database convention just got hit by a meteorite. It was all I could do to swim my fat ass out of the water before it could bite off my fisherman's basket. Whereupon the game said, I'm so sorry, you're nowhere near in the league to be fighting that thing. Let's just say no more about it and you can get right back to picking tufts of grass. I took a few more ocean-related missions, but I didn't run into it again. It's not a point in a game's favor when I am literally standing at the water's edge, ringing a dinner bell with my balls on a skillet in the vain hope of making something interesting happen. You can get a version of Monster Hunter Try with a classic controller included, and if this video has made you realize how badly the game needs to be a part of your life, then I strongly advise you to get it. You can play the game with a Wiimote and nunchuck in the same way that you could technically compete in a fencing competition using only your erect penis. Controlling the camera with the Wiimote directional buttons rather than a good solid dependable analog stick is like sitting on a lazy Susan mounted to the back of a charging horse and trying to steer the creature with a tennis ball on the end of a piece of string. There's also an attempt to create a game world full of sweeping exotic landscapes that modestly succeeds but have to be broken up by loading screen airlocks every 50 yards so the Wii processor doesn't put a blunderbuss under its chin and indirectly improve the overall worth of the gaming industry by several large increments. The game has no business being on the Wii. I'm not sure it has business being anywhere, except perhaps a boredom convention being held in the heart of the sun. I'll say one thing for Alan Wake straight away. You can never accuse it of being rushed out. Planning began in 2001. Fuck, the space program didn't last that long. Well, let's not look a gift whore in the poo pipe. Alan Wake is a self-styled psychological action game that borrows somewhat heavily from Twin Peaks and arm-dislocatingly heavily from the works of Stephen King. It's about a writer with personal problems being tormented by an unknowable evil in small-town America. You know, the same plot as that one book Stephen King has been writing over and over again since 1975. I'm not a fan personally, but someone at Remedy almost certainly is. He gets name dropped like 4 times. In fact, Stephen King's name is the very first piece of spoken dialogue, so basically Alan Wake has its virgin bumhole offered squarely to Stephen King, with a whipped cream arrow on its back pointing down. The game opens with a nightmare, full of the usual sort of nightmare imagery, running through a dark forest, being chased by some indistinct evil force, a big voice in the sky giving you a combat tutorial, until Alan wakes up. Oh, I see what you did there. To find a hideous, grinning mannequin creature leering over him. Oh wait, that's his wife. There's something very fucked up about the human faces in this game. She looks like she's been using Botox to treat her chronic face tumours. And I've seen better lip-syncing in episodes of Captain Scarlet. Anyway, Alan and his pet monster are on holiday in a small lakeside town when Alan throws a hissy fit because his wife expects him, a professional writer, to actually do some writing at some point, and then a hideous, unknowable evil kidnaps her so they can trade beauty tips. It's up to Alan to come to the rescue and uncover the dark secrets of the town, both of which he feels can best be achieved by running around in a dark forest for several several hours gibbering to himself. Throughout the game, Alan gives a running narration of events, which is almost always completely redundant at best. While most games would just put a smelly dog in a room and maybe design the room so the player sees the smelly dog as soon as they come in, Alan Wake adds a voiceover going, "Suddenly, I saw a smelly dog in the room," and wrestles the camera from you to show the smelly dog guiltily shitting in a hat. In fact, this game has a generally low opinion of your attention span. It's presented episodically, and each episode begins with a recap of the story so far. You might think, oh listener, that the intention is to give clear stopping points, although I've always felt games that out and out instruct you to stop playing them would be difficult to explain to the marketing department, but there's no opportunity to save and quit between the episode end and the next one, so its only function is to give a quick recap of the plot every few hours, and if you're being so distracted by your mother desperately belly dancing for attention in the corner of the living room that you need one, then I think you have bigger problems. And then there are the moments when monsters appear, and the camera zooms into them, goes slow motion, and yells, "Hey, there are monsters here! Look, look, can you see them? Good, because we wouldn't want this game to get scary, would we?" It's mystifying, because the environments do a good job of building atmosphere, with Eldritch Light illuminating the mist that coils around the trees, flickering shadows making an innocent mulberry bush momentarily look like a round-shouldered murderer with an axe and a massive erection. It's just that the game is fully aware that it does dark, spooky forests best, but little else, so every half hour it has to contrive a new reason for Alan to be lost in a spooky forest at night. It's like a crime drama about a detective who can only concentrate when he's around pastry, so every week the crime has to conveniently take place in a bakery or within walking distance of a pie shop. The forest sections are the obligatory action part of the psychological action promise, so they mercilessly pad themselves out for hours of atmospheric but nonetheless samey scenery, until I'm going, fine, I'll put up with your Botox-faced hand puppet sausage people cutscenes, just enough with the fucking haunted logging mills already. As for the combat itself, the idea is you wear down the shadow creature's defences with your flashlight before gunning down their physical form. Since this essentially means you can stun-lock your enemies by looking at them, I only ever needed to use the starting pistol and had bucketfuls of ammo and flash grenades handy for the occasional hairier moment. As long as I could keep backing away and duck the odd scythe or hand axe flung Resident Evil 4 style, then the combat was as mechanical and predictable as a factory production line. Shine the light in their eyes, then two shots, bang bang, like an indecisive hitman stroke optician. I did like the bits where the darkness possesses inanimate objects and starts flinging them at you like an angry spouse chucking teacups, except the teacups are lengths of 3 foot thick industrial piping. It's actually quite hectic and unnerving, although spoiled somewhat when Alan blithely narrates, "Hey, inanimate objects coming to life. That's a theme that Stephen King likes to explore, isn't it? Have I mentioned that we like him?" But let's conclude by returning to the all-important story. One of the side quests involves gathering manuscript pages, which all unfailingly spoil upcoming plot events, which is kind of in keeping with the theme, so I'll let it slide, but it's a shame Alan never uses his foreknowledge to prevent any of the phenomenally bad decisions he's destined to make. For example, accepting the hospitality of a character who, despite her previously cheerful demeanour, is now speaking in a strange, emotionless monotone with cold, dead eyes, and wearing a t-shirt reading, "I am possessed," without even entertaining the notion of her being possessed until after having some of her homemade lemon and sleeping pill tea. Or, when the comic relief character, in the sense that it's a huge relief when he shuts his fat fucking mouth, suggests getting shit-faced while trapped in a house surrounded by evil shadow murderers, agreeing to do so instead of punching him in the head, and indeed missing all the other opportunities throughout the game to punch him in the head. But I suppose there are lots of horror stories that wouldn't exist at all if people never made bad decisions in them, and Alan Wake is certainly all about bad decisions. Bad combat, bad narration, good atmosphere. Picture an elegantly decorated house through which soft classical music plays, and occasionally an obese man in a Halloween mask charges through it, swinging a football rattle and screaming at the top of his voice. He's weirdly fascinating for the first few laps, but then he pulls down your curtains and shits on a doily. Have I mentioned that I wrote a novel and you can pre-order it from Amazon and Amazon.co.uk? Well, I wrote a novel and you can pre-order it from Amazon and Amazon.co.uk. You know, Rockstar, you don't have to keep bending over backwards to please me. When I said that all the cars in GTA 4 handled like there's a fat baby attached to the steering wheel, they brought out The Lost and Damned, which centered around a motorcycle gang. But that was even worse, because characters in GTA always seem to hold onto motorbikes as loosely as possible in case they catch crotch rot from the seats, and the graphics are so murky that riding down a busy road at high speed is making a foolish wager with the quintuple somersault head injury fairy. Alright then, said Rockstar, here's the Ballad of Gay Tony, where every other mission is helicopter-based, but the helicopters handle worst of all. It's like you're constantly airlifting a fucking merry-go-round with a hippo on one side. Alright then, motherfucker, says Rockstar, let's just set GTA 100 years ago so you don't have to drive motorized vehicles at all. Are you happy now? To which I reply, my horse appears to be lodged in a wall. Red Dead Redemption, aka Grand Theft Horse 4, is set in the last days of the Old West when America was collectively realizing how stupid everyone looked in those big flappy trousers. Our hero John Marston is Nico Bellic in all but name and sexy accent, a straight-talking cynical badass trying to escape from his evil past and who is easily distracted by minigames. John is being forced by the government to track down and kill his former gang members, who have been laughing and waving their grizzled willies in the face of law and order for too long, in return for which John will be allowed to resume his new simple life of farming with his wife and son. That's the redemption part. Although I'm yet to figure out how the rest of the title comes into it, he's not dead and the game isn't particularly red either, but I expect brown alive redemption wouldn't have sat well with marketing. Blue Poo Atonement uses the tried and tested formula. You have a big sandbox and occasionally people's initials appear on the map when they want to talk at you in a cutscene for half an hour, then while riding somewhere for another half hour before making you shoot some people they don't like. The lion's share of the game is spent watching a horse's ass bob up and down through an empty wilderness as like a big hairy apple on a string, as the prairie isn't as densely populated as Liberty City. Not with humans, anyway. And let me vent how frustrating it was when I stopped to hunt some pigs after riding for an hour from the last save point, only to be blindsided and insta-killed by a mountain lion who mistook me for a small antlerless moose in a duster coat. What humans you do run into more often than not try to kill you, rob you, steal your horse, or challenge you to come and pick flowers with them, apparently having trouble reading the signals. The sandbox reminds me of World of Warcraft in many ways. Beautiful scenery, full of not much of anything, wandering monsters, the occasional resource gathering grind quest, and all the human beings you run into want to teabag your corpse and call you a fag. It's a brutal world, but not as brutal as the physics. The Euphoria engine makes me very sad, which is ironic when you think about it. I hate action games where you have to hold down a button to run, because there's no such thing as a casual firefight where you're free to mosey nonchalantly into cover, but when you have to also tap the button to sprint, I think that's just deliberately trying to upset me. It's so easy to overshoot, you have the most tremendous difficulty walking up 6-inch steps, and even turning around is arduous. I lost count of how often I'd slam into the side of a doorway, turn around, try again, and slam into the other side. It's like I'm controlling someone who's riding a fucking unicycle, or more appropriately, drunk. And when your character is drunk, it's like controlling someone who's drunk on lead-based paint, fired into their face with a shotgun. The horse physics aren't much better. Most missions have you riding side by side with another character, and the trails are so narrow I swear those guys were trying to run me off the road, all the while blithely chatting about humanist philosophy. And this is when the game isn't just bugging out. Sometimes NPCs will get caught in weird quantum singularities and flicker in and out of a parallel universe where men have merged with horses. Sometimes John's walk animation fails and he glides merrily around like he's on rocket skates. At one point his love of his country got the better of him and I had to reboot so he'd stop humping a mountain. And of course the classic black screen freeze up, although that might have just been me falling asleep from all the travel time. Control and bug issues aside, Greenspleen Submarine is in all honesty very absorbing. It's immersive enough that I could play for hours at a time, and when I finally did tear myself away, I'd catch myself standing with my hips cocked and my thumbs in my belt while waiting for the bus. I was one of the few people who enjoyed the sailing in Zelda Wind Waker because I like an open world to feel big, which is not the same as simply being big. The howling prairie all around you feels a lot more epic than the tea tray shallow behemoth of Just Cause 2. But what annoys me is that so much of Purple Monkey Dishwasher just has no point at all. As I said, you can get drunk if you feel the controls just aren't shitty enough for your tastes. You can play cards, horseshoes, knifey finger, you can break horses, you can break kneecaps, and spending the equivalent time sitting on a cactus lassoing your own bollocks has precisely the same gameplay benefit. Most of the things you can buy are guns, which you get for free on missions anyway, and items that restore health, stamina, and bullet time, all of which regenerate by themselves. So money is pointless, and so is anything you can do to make money. Bounty hunting is done solely for the exercise, picking flowers is done solely to emasculate yourself, and hunting animals is done solely to exact petty revenge on mountain lions. It's all done for its own sake, which may in itself be the point, to give us a magical playground unfettered by gameplay obligations, but I thought the game part of the term video game kind of implied that gameplay obligations were what I wanted. So just going through the missions, you can expect about 10 to 15 hours, which is still a nice, robust length, but you'll breeze through it like a prune and laxative sandwich. It's a game that never takes off your training wheels, your gun auto-aims like your fussy mum is holding the barrel, and your bullet time might as well be unlimited, and horseback chases lack the intensity of car chases when the maximum speed wouldn't startle a nervous fawn, which is incidentally about the most hazardous thing that might get in your way. In summary, Red Dead Redemption is a beautiful-looking, beautifully written, beautifully atmospheric time sink, and if a time sink is all you want, then Christmas has come early, on a glitchy horse that's stuck in a wall. Have I mentioned that I wrote a novel and you can pre-order it from Amazon and Amazon.co.uk? Well, I wrote a novel and you can pre-order it from Amazon and Amazon.co.uk. Well, at least the delayed release of Mario Galaxy 2 is giving me a chance to get through my backlog. Now, just as Roger Ebert's authority on video games is comparable to that of a man who has been trapped in a space capsule for 30 years with a broken Game & Watch, I have little time for films. Apparently they're like games, but they basically unfold without you having to do anything, like the next logical step for the Final Fantasy series. I'm informed that one relating to Prince of Persia came out recently, and it's shit. I haven't seen it, and never will, but you should never be too proud to prejudge, as my prosecutor used to say. Anyway, by strange coincidence, a new Prince of Persia game came out at around the same time, but Forgotten Sands seems to be consciously trying not to look like something that was rushed out to capitalise on the film, which is a shame because it totally does, and it totally was. So forget about Jake Gyllenhaal's fantastically close resemblance to a swarthy Arabian man. Forgotten Sands' plot is unrelated and is intended to be slotted into canon just after the original Sands of Time game, and as well as the sand, asks us to forget about Warrior Within, Two Thrones, and that cel-shaded thing. Fucking hell, I am so on board with this plan, Captain Forgotten Sands. Let's set sail for adventure, toot toot! Any chance we can retcon Prince of Persia 3D out of existence while we're at it? Having grown tired of the prince's passive-aggressive sarcastic whining, his dad has sent him to stay with his brother, presumably also a prince, who has his own kingdom, King Sharaman never having been one for dropping subtle hints. I mean, when my parents wanted me to move out, they just stopped cooking me dinner. Anyway, the prince, the other prince that is, not our prince, attempts to stop an invading army by unleashing an evil race of monsters who turn everyone to stone. At least it wasn't your fault this time, but that doesn't mean you're not the one who's going to have to sort it all out. Oh no, what do you think this is? A film? If you're new to my opinions, let me remind everyone that Prince of Persia Sands of Time is, without hyperbole, the greatest work of artistic endeavour in the history of anything. Linear platforming as smooth and flowy as a bar of soap in a deep fat fryer, and writing far far above average for video games, the average for video games being somewhere around the mantle layer of the Earth. I suspect Forgotten Sands was built on the same engine as Sands of Time, since it's pretty much the same, but dipped in HD graphics rendering, and the prince gets the power to reverse time again, because that's kind of his thing. Seems like magic time reversing artifacts are like Tamagotchis in Ancient Arabia. The moment I picked up the controller, I went straight back into the Sands of Time groove, automatically wall running and jumping and climbing until I went into a trance. And yet, the platforming doesn't flow as well as it used to. I wondered why this game doesn't have a slow motion power, but it turns out it does. It's just activated all the time. Plus, the camera is a fickle beast that often refuses to rotate far enough to show you what you want to see until you've flattered it with shallow compliments, and the prince's hair and beard make him look like a ventriloquist dummy of Dr. Zaius. Of course, the combat was the worst part of Sands of Time, so Forgotten Sands makes the most of its HD upgrade to introduce crowd-based combat where you must fight off entire high school reunions of sand zombies. There's a terrible attack delay on your part that makes fighting sticky and unwieldy, and attacking a specific priority target among the horde is about as exact a science as using an earth-moving device to pick the raisins out of your muesli. But all the monsters have to spend at least 5 seconds telegraphing their attacks, then filling out a permission slip from head office and waiting 3 to 5 weeks for a response before they can actually hit you, so the combat turns into a fight over the TV remote at the nursing home. The now inevitable RPG elements also let you build up 4 different magic combat spells, but frankly, any experience points sunk into any spell besides the area of effect shockwave attack, you might as well have just blown on sweeties and copies of FHM. Since the game was rushed out for the film and everything, there's also a little variation in enemies, especially towards the end when they're rolling out the same big boss lads every 5 minutes, so the combat overall feels severely token. One time there was an expository cutscene, then a completely meaningless fight with some monsters, then the cutscene resumed where it left off. I had to laugh because it was basically the game saying, "Shit, I just remembered I'm a game!" The prince in Forgotten Sands is probably the closest he's ever been to how he was in Sands of Time, a cocky aristocrat who somehow draws acrobatic energy from passive-aggressively whinging to himself. So why does he seem like so much more of a prat? Well, he was always a prat, but he also had a significant character arc in Sands of Time in which we learn that he's really an insecure daddy's boy who acts aloof and arrogant because he doesn't know how to express his emotions, and all he really wants is a great big hug. But in Forgotten Sands, we just have all of the sarcastic prick with none of the growth, and we all know the best kind of prick is one with a growth on it. You see, Sands of Time's story was so good because its lead characters and their parallel development are absolutely central to the plot. You can't just take one aspect of that and expect it to perform just as well. It's like playing Castle on a Cloud on a kazoo and expecting people to like it as much as the whole of Les Miserables. I think I must have been a flying squirrel in a former life, as my brain is hardwired to enjoy this sort of platforming, and Forgotten Sands has enough of it for me to find enjoyable by default. The ending's a bit disappointing, especially when it devolves into a series of still images with voiceover in a way that yodels, "Our cinematic budget ran out." Overall, there's just something terribly cynical about Forgotten Sands that makes me uneasy. It's also by the numbers. When the large bull-like enemy was introduced, I instantly paused the game and announced, "This enemy will charge at me, but if I dodge out of the way at the last second, it will run into a wall and stun itself." Then I unpaused the game, and thus were proven my powers of clairvoyance. It seems like if you've completed a trilogy, and lest we forget, rebooted the fucking thing, going back to mind the last game you were sure was good just isn't very classy, like stealing leftovers from the bins outside an upmarket restaurant and serving them to your dinner guests. Plus, it was brought out to capitalize on a film, and films are a load of old cobblers. "See, Roger Ebert? That's what it feels like." As the operator of a coin-operated artillery cannon might sarcastically yell to a retreating army, you should never be afraid of change. The youthful medium of gaming has grown out of the processor power arms race that took up most of its childhood, and has finally begun shaving its bum fluff and touching itself at night as it enters an awkward puberty. There will be a lot of changes to come, and you shouldn't fear them. You should resist them, though. You got to dig your heels in and show these changes who's the bitch before everything we've worked for all these years sells itself wholesale to the kinds of bejeweled playing child-having twat mackerels who've spent the last 2 decades nodding meaningfully to each other every time a Sega Genesis is found in the home of a murderer. Regular viewers will know that whenever E3 rolls around, I like to devote a video to discouraging people from getting too excited, but this year it almost feels like turning a fire hose on a cigarette butt. If gaming is going through puberty, then motion controls are its first period. It's become clear to me now that motion controls are something each game company just needs to get out of their system. Nintendo were the early bloomers who are now saying, "Motion controls? What are those? We're just making 5 million reboots of our popular franchises." And I'm all like, "Oh Nintendo, it's like you never left us." But now Microsoft and Sony are triumphantly waving their bloodstained underpants. Let me make my position clear. Gaming should be about games, not about controllers. Controllers as they stand are a perfectly adequate conduit for connecting man to machine by way of thumbs. It doesn't matter if A Tale of Two Cities is printed on the side of a horse, or if every other word is in Greek. What matters is that Sidney Carton sacrifices himself for Charles Darnay at the end, spoiler alert. Delude yourself all you like with videos of happy families and pastel-coloured shirts spending quality time with bouncy castle simulators, but in the long term, people want to play games the same way they want to read books or watch TV. Slouched on the settee with a big bag of Maltesers, how on earth do you think forcing them to do a sit-up every now and again is going to revolutionise entertainment? So anyway, Microsoft's Kinect thing, a combination of Kinect, Kinetic, and some colossal wankers in marketing. Apparently it's like the Wii, except it reads your movements without needing a controller, so everything will be fine until a wasp gets in the room, and then your character will promptly throw all their grenades away and pummel a chair. The launch titles are an array of colourful family fun, sports, fitness, and playgroup activity centres too forcedly cheerful to list. "Games anyone can enjoy," promises the blurb. Well, what about people who want to go and see Phantom of the Opera every now and again rather than the Christmas panto every fucking night, Microsoft? What about them? People who like games about crying widowers bleeding their last on filthy basement floor claws, who don't want to express their inner child because they wrapped up their inner child in bin liners and tossed it off a bridge. I will grant you, though, Connectimals' box art is the most terrifying thing I've seen all year. It looks like what would happen if John Wayne Gacy worked at Disneyland. You might have realized that if any of you had souls, rather than clockwork emotion simulators that run on money. This is probably why they keep wheeling Peter Molyneux out, because he's the only person they know with actual emotions. Very strange emotions, unique to Peter Molyneux, but emotions nonetheless. So after Microsoft Kinect's butchering of the English language comes the PlayStation Move, a much more appealingly straightforward name, almost authoritative really, like an order barked by a drill sergeant. It uses a controller that's completely different to the Wiimote because it's got a big shiny bell end. In all seriousness, this is just sad. It's like a huge smelly tramp putting a spandex leotard on over his crusty trousers and trying to enter a children's athletics competition. With similarly straightforwardly named titles like The Fight and The Shoot promised, it seems like Sony are aiming for a slightly more hardcore audience. But that's even worse. Motion controls are at least somewhat attractive to the casual pastel shirt family fun time brigade, but surely actual gamer gaming technology should be working towards controls that use smaller movements, not larger ones, to enhance immersion by minimizing the separation between thought and on-screen action. I noticed Sony are re-releasing a couple of games to use the Move system, including Heavy Rain, because I remember thinking at the time its story would have made much more sense if I'd been waving my arms around like a cat in a grandfather clock. Speaking of re-releasing, as I mentioned earlier, Nintendo is busily tearing its way through all its intellectual property and isn't releasing a single game that can't be prefixed with the words Another Bloody, as in Another Bloody Zelda, Another Bloody Donkey Kong, and of course Another Bloody Metroid, developed by Team Ninja of Dead or Alive Extreme Beach Volleyball fame, so I look forward to seeing how they work jiggle physics into Samus Aran's power armor, and a hefty shovelful of Nintendo's back catalogue is being remade for the 3DS, a concept that is literally impossible to demonstrate in picture or video, which rather shoots the advertising potential in the foot, but who cares, it's just a gimmick. Stereoscopic 3D is a thing that's being desperately pushed by movie companies because they're trying anything to stop cinemas from becoming irrelevant in a world where everyone has a home entertainment system the size of a small retirement cottage. And it's only a matter of time before everyone collectively realizes that 3D as it stands is about as immersive as sitting too close to a glove puppet of James Cameron. Call me when they've invented the 3D hologram view screens from Star Trek, or when Nintendo's entire staff commits suicide with carbon monoxide fumes. Just time to finish off with some third-party games. XCOM, which now isn't set in the near future and isn't turn-based, so it could have called itself Custard Pie Fights with Christopher Walken, and that would have been equally relevant. Star Wars, The Old Republic. Fair enough, I mean, of all the things that try to unseat WoW from the Memorpga throne, Star Wars is the one thing over which nerds get even weirder. Metal Gear Solid Rising. Listen to me, Hideo Kojima, you really need to face the fact that nobody likes Raiden as much as you seem to. I mean, no one can say you didn't do all you could. You made him a cyborg breakdancing ninja, and somehow he's still a little bitch, and I don't see how having him prepare fruit salad will remedy that.
As I theorized back in my review of the original No More Heroes, Suda51 is the result of a cloning experiment to create the world's most auteur game designer. Now, the one thing everyone knows about clones is that they suffer from premature aging, but they seem to have licked that problem if Suda51 is any evidence. No More Heroes 2 Desperate Strugglers finally gotten past the border patrol to the PAL territories, and having played through it, I can confidently state that there is absolutely no worry of Suda51 getting more mature. At some point between Nomiro's 1 and Nomiro's 2, someone introduced him to the concept of jiggle physics, and thus has begun a friendship to last a lifetime. The fact that all the women in the game wear fetish outfits and are either in love with you or have to be bloodily murdered with your giant throbbing sci-fi memorabilia does feel a little bit backward. I wouldn't usually have a problem, but I thought I'd better express disapproval so I don't get stabbed by Rebecca Mays. No More Heroes 2 returns us to the exploits of Travis Touchdown, a massive nerd who also happens to be the world's greatest swordsman. It's a concept that makes a lot of sense to me. A nerd, after all, is someone who obsesses over something like the cultural impact of gaming or people who criticize same in silly internet videos, but just because you're staying indoors and foregoing female companionship to learn fighting techniques rather than practice Guitar Hero or mop up your watery spunk with your Japanese love pillow doesn't make you any less of a total dweebo spodmeister with the social skills of a nervous badger. Anyway, Travis is thrust back into the fighting tournament when his best friend is murdered, reducing Travis's social circle to zero plus one cat. He starts out at the 50th rank this time, but you skip most of those numbers and pretty much fight the same number of bosses as in Nomiro's 1. Presumably the 50 ranks thing is in place to stop party poopers saying unhelpful things like, isn't this just exactly the same setup as the first game, but with wobbly chests and a fatter pussy? Well, be silent, party poopers, for things are different. The sandbox has been entirely vacuumed up and replaced with a menu-based transport system, which just goes to show what wavelength Suda51 is on. Traditionally, a sequel is supposed to add features, not delete them. The sandbox in the first game earned some vicious beatings because the city was about as lively as a Saturday night in the International Space Station, but I thought it could have been saved by adding some more exploration mechanics, cars that react amusingly when you plow your bike into them, and maybe not making us traipse back to the job center like a lost lamb every time we wanted to do a minigame, and then traipse all the way to the location of the minigame before gnap gnap rawr. Simply removing the sandbox element from the game entirely seems a bit lazy, almost childish really. We complain that Suda51's ball was a funny shape and had been kicked through a few dog turds, so now he's picking up his ball and going home, so now no one gets to play ball and his hands smell of dog turd. Nice one. You still have to do odd job minigames to make money, but now, and I hope you're wearing a sturdy belt because you may split your sides, they all take the form of retro 8-bit style games. Ha ha, what a clever ironic joke. A clever ironic joke that gets made about 10 times, and which you'll have plenty of time to enjoy because you need to grind these games to make enough money for the 7 or 8 things in the entire game that are available for purchase. As quirky referential humour, it's all very clever in that Tarantino style of not in retrospect being particularly clever at all, but as a gameplay mechanic it serves as a harsh reminder of why, outside of maybe towns surrounded by wasteland in the outlying district aspect of Eastern Europe, most people don't play with Nesses anymore for the same reason we don't launder clothes by slapping them against rocks. Christ, I don't even remember how we managed to game before the invention of the analog stick. Maybe this was why we were all such pricks when we were kids. Fortunately, having money proves largely unnecessary, but this creates the Red Dead Redemption problem of being more like a box of toys than a coherent game. In this case, a box of ironic retro toys kept on display in the living room of the world's biggest tosser. What all this makes clearer than ever before is that a good percentage of Nemiro's is so much cotton wool, just there to fill the spaces between the central boss fights, before each of which you must clear out a succession of rooms full of generic and incredibly repetitive bad guys, some of whom have stupid amounts of health but are very easily stun-locked, so it's not even a challenge, it's just a delaying tactic, like forcing you to eat 20 dry Jacob's cream crackers before you can have any brie. And Nemiro's 2's concession to difficulty curves is to make these sections longer and longer with each mission. There's one in a car park that I swear doesn't stop spawning baddies until you've killed more people than vitamin E deficiency. The Wiimote controls continue to be about as intuitive and immersive as a swimming pool full of concrete, so let the record show this was the game that made me finally shell out for a classic controller, which are clearly not designed for the larger-handed gentleman. Perhaps there should have been a port for the 360 after all. A hack-and-slash game aimed specifically at gamers being exclusive to the Wii is like a Matisse masterpiece being exclusive to the Etch-a-Sketch. As might reasonably be expected, the boss fights are the best part, another array of colourful murderers like a cross between Enter the Dragon and Cannonball Run 2, with enough giant robot fights to break up the succession of button-mashing dodge-block combo wrestle with horrible camera routines. There are a couple of fights where you play a different character with a jump ability that's as smooth and controllable as a fat dog on a trampoline, so naturally she has to do some platforming, because after you've jammed a corkscrew through someone's palm, you might as well give it a twist while you're at it. But on the whole, I'm just kind of disappointed by No More Heroes 2. It feels like a holding pattern, adding very little and subtracting a few things too, and I think I preferred Travis when he was an oblivious loser being insulted, manipulated, and beaten up by everyone around him, because now he's all famous and desired by women, less lovable cockend, and more cockend who deserves tire iron nasal surgery. I suspect there might be some author insertion wish fulfillment going on. Guess there weren't many titties to be found in Containment Tube 0051. To say Nintendo overused their intellectual property is like saying a parasitic wasp overuses the caterpillar it lays its eggs in, and which its babies will eat away from the inside in a startling allegory for human relationships. Throughout history, Nintendo producing Mario platformers has been as inevitable as genital disease producing strange and worrying fluids, but at least they made an effort to mix up the formula each time. Mario 3 introduced the world map, Mario World introduced a slightly suspect relationship with a shoe-wearing dinosaur, Mario Sunshine introduced copiously weeing on people. So what does Mario Galaxy 2 do that no other Mario game has done before? Well, just one thing. Stagnate. Oh, wait a second, I forgot about New Super Mario Bros. Wii. In that case, fuck all. This is normally the point where I recap the plot, but this time, why don't you all sing along? There are three entities, Mario, Princess Peach, and Bowser, the Ego, the Super Ego, and the Id. One of these entities kidnaps another, and the third has to go in pursuit of them. See if you can figure out which is which. This game made me realise that the plots of many Mario games can be enlivened somewhat by assuming that cake is the Mushroom Kingdom word for sex. The princess invites Mario over for some cake, but Bowser kidnaps her so that she can make some cake for him instead. Only now he's 500 feet tall and Emperor of the Universe, so she'd better make sure her cake is spread quite wide. Needless to say, this is the same plot as Mario Galaxy 1 with zero acknowledgement of continuity. No little mushroom person at any point says, didn't this exact same thing happen not however long ago? Say, did anyone remember to press charges on Bowser last time he pulled this? Put him in prison or something? What exactly was stopping him turning around and pulling the same shit the moment Mario and the princess were distracted with each other's cakes? See people, this is why we need to introduce a constitutional monarchy. Wark, wark. Okay, so Bowser kidnapping the princess is sort of traditional, like hanging, drawing, and quartering. And when Mario Galaxy 1 did it, I figured, well, fair enough, they're introducing the concept to all the new audience of casual gamer shitheads that the Wii suckered in, each of which I'm prepared to personally seal away in some kind of medieval oubliette, but whatever, we play the cards we're dealt. But Mario Galaxy 2 doesn't have that excuse. It seems reasonable to me that the chief audience for Galaxy 2 is people who played Galaxy 1, but the game seems to assume that you didn't, or at least it sincerely hopes you didn't. Mario himself seems confused on the Wii menu. Super Mario Galaxy! He shrieks, omitting the incremental digit. Exactly how stupid does Nintendo think people are? To find an answer to that question, I feel I should point out that as well as a manual, the game box also contains a separate piece of paper reiterating the controls with the large colourful visual aids, and a DVD in which the controls are cooed a third time by a woman with the same patient motherly voice she'd used to potty train a brain-damaged two-year-old, and a big glossy photograph of the Wii console itself, as if to say, put it in this! Moving on from Nintendo's no-drooling mongoloid left behind policy, Mario Galaxy 1's hub world has been replaced by a spaceship in the shape of Mario's head, the space-going equivalent of personalised number plates, and you just know from looking at him Mario's the kind of asshole who overtakes on the hard shoulder. Anyway, Starship Narcissus is where Mario keeps the characters he meets on his travels as some sick collection of living trophies, and there are some extra lives and pickups that respawn each time you return, so if, like me, you're completely psychotic, then after every level you have to run around collecting them all again so everything can be neat and tidy. From the crown of Mario's giant spacefaring ego, you can then access the map screen. What is it with Wii games and map screens lately? It's like every Wii developer struggling to squeeze respectable gaming experiences into the Wii processor limitations woke up one morning saying, hey, we could just do that thing the NES did that's one step up from picking from a drop-down menu and not have to do as much work. God help us if anyone shows them a text adventure. I shouldn't even have to talk about the core gameplay. I'd consider it an insult to you and me. My review of Mario Galaxy 1 hasn't gone anywhere. Why not pause this video, pour yourself a glass of wine, and go and enjoy that. I'll just wait here, slapping myself in the face until you return.
Finished? Right, well, Mario Galaxy 2 is more of that. More jumping around on things and more wankers cramped from all the Wiimote shaking. They did add Yoshi now, though, so the major bold new addition to the formula is an idea from 1990. And there are new power-ups based on becoming a cloud and a rock, both ideas I assume were acquired by looking out of a window during a dull brainstorming meeting. This is something we used to call an expansion pack, and which Nintendo apparently calls ka-ching. Several bosses and encounters are copied wholesale in the noble cause of knocking off work early, but the individual level designs are different, although get stun-locked down one bottomless pit, been stun-locked down them all. And when I say different, I mean different to Mario Galaxy 1, for there is one level that is a bold-facedly copied, open quotes, tribute to a level from Mario 64, which indicates two things. A, Mario 64 definitely hasn't aged well, and B, that dull brainstorming meeting must have run out of snacks at some point. I guess the fanbase will get the franchise it deserves, but is this really all you want? Yes, there are games I like, games I love. Do I want to play a new installment of the same thing every few years? No! The fastest way to spoil your pleasures is to make them routine. Variety is the spice of life, and status quo is the starch. The star that shines brightest is all the more glorious for its brevity. Or to bring this metaphor down to a broader cultural level, The Simpsons has been running for 21 seasons and hasn't been good since the fifth. I would rather see things evolve. Before any defenders of motion controllers get in touch, evolve in ways that aren't stupid. You know what, Mario fans? You want to stay tucked up in your little comfort zone, playing the same game, ordering the same pizza every night till you're on first name terms with all the delivery boys? That doesn't bother me. I'll even admit that Galaxy 2 is fun, but you have to do something for me in return. I want you to go out this weekend and do something you've never done before. Go skydiving, get drunk at a football match and glass someone, meet a nice member of the opposite sex and invite them out for some cake. Let's face it, real history is boring. It's just a load of idiots eating too much of a cow and killing each other over which nostril Christ was breathing out of on the cross. So I can understand the appeal of alternate history fiction. Imagine if the Persians had won the Battle of Salamis, the present day would be almost completely the same. Or if King John had signed the Magna Carta while wearing bunny ears, the possibilities are endless. So why in the name of bollock burgers do we keep coming back to the same alternate history where the Cold War escalated? I know how disappointing it was that we didn't get to have another big fancy war like in the 40s, but if you're fine with rewriting histories that Americans are actually heroic underdogs, rather than both sides being dicks to a precise equal degree, why don't we ever see games where the Viet Cong have laser guns or the Taliban have giant robot snakes? Is the entire games industry being blackmailed by the Russian voice actors union? Anyway, Singularity is good news for alternate history fans because the time travel thing means it goes through a whole mess of different alternate histories before it's over. These particular ones are driven by the Russians discovering a mysterious new element called Element 99, which can manipulate time and space and mutate living things into zombies, gamma, or anything in between, and can no doubt also tenderize meat and shine your shoes and whatever else is convenient. It also enhanced my burgeoning powers of clairvoyance after the intro cinematic set up the first alternate history and explained how you, a Black Ops American soldier, are being sent in to investigate the abandoned island where the Convenium experiments took place 60 years ago, I instantly knew what was going to happen next. The screen was going to fade up on me sitting in a helicopter directly opposite a support character with the doors irresponsibly hanging wide open to show us the scenery we're going to spend the next 10 hours ruining. And lo was it so. Then I got bonus points when the helicopter crashed 2 seconds later. Now I know what you're thinking, what with my precognitive powers and everything, you're thinking, ooh, a first-person shooter themed around time manipulation. This wouldn't happen to manifest as some kind of slow-motion ability, would it? Surprisingly, no. Didn't you hear? Bullet time is so yesterday, Grandad. Instead, at certain fixed moments in the plot, you travel back in time to 1955 to make specific changes to the world of the present and to ensure your parents hook up at the enchantment under the sea And naturally, the plot ends up with more holes than Blackburn, Lancashire. If all the history after 1955 gets changed, then why am I still in the present? How do all the other characters know the history was changed? Actually, they do explain that. Someone left a note. Now, I don't know about you, but I like to think of myself as credulous enough to not form international secret societies at the behest of time travel conspiracy theories on random pieces of paper. It'd be like seeing some bathroom graffiti and forming a religion around Big Hank. The other time-based mechanic is your ability to age and revert selected objects. Most of the time, this just acts as the continue game button. You know, I need to take a flight of stairs, but they're all broken in. But not to worry, I'll just use my all-powerful time manipulation device to youthen it back to before it was broken, rather than, say, fetch a couple of planks. It does have tactical applications too, but aging an enemy to dust is just an insta-kill, while making them younger turns them into a mindless slavering beast, and hey, I've got an idea. Why don't we go back in time and change history so that makes any kind of fucking sense? Maybe it's meant to be an allegory for the teenage years. I would have respected the game if you could turn enemies into babies, then maybe you could give them a grenade to suck on and chuck them at his mates just to show you're not fucking around. Basically, the age revert thing does whatever it needs to do at the time, like a separate use button, and strategically less useful than, say, some kind of handheld device that launches small pieces of metal at high speed towards whatever enemies you're pointed at. Stripped of its rather pointless gimmick, Singularity is a game that can't decide if it wants to be Bioshock, Half-Life, or Time Shift, and is inferior to all three. Bioshock is probably the game it was sitting directly behind in the exam room, with audio logs and the RPG elements and E99 instead of Adam as all-purpose plot dietary fibre. It's even got those cute 50s public information cartoons that Bioshock ripped off from Fallout. It's like a magnificent human centipede stretching through gaming history. And I now find myself having to explain what RPG elements are for to a company that has developed games since I was 9. You see, in Bioshock, the superpowers and upgrades were appropriate because combat was intense and unforgiving and you needed every edge you could get. But in Singularity, you fight the same enemies throughout and hot lead never loses its effectiveness pointless in the wrecking up of the shit. How exactly is reducing my shotgun's reload speed by a tenth of a second going to be the game changer that justifies having me sift through a mutant's belly button fluff looking for upgrade points? But the very last way Singularity imitates Bioshock, like a small child with two broken legs attempting to copy his dad's powerful stride, is in the plot twist, which is presented identically as Bioshock's, right down to the little flashy montage of clues from throughout the game for the slow of remembering. And get your biggest tampons ready, because I'm about to be a massive cunt and reveal Singularity's plot twist. At the start of the game, when you're first flashback to 1955, you save a random scientist from a burning building. Seconds later, when you flashback to 2010, the world is under Russian rule and there are big statues of the random scientist all over the place. And then, at the end, the truth is grandly revealed, that history was changed because of you saving that guy. Then, after checking to make sure I hadn't turned over two pages at once, I said, "Are you shitting me? You're passing as the big twist, the thing that was established half an hour in. I was expecting the bad guy to be the good guy, or to be me from the future, or made entirely of asparagus. Maybe it's a plot twist designed specifically for people who intermittently fell asleep while playing the game. In which case, hearty congratulations for understanding your audience, Raven Software." So let's return to the burning issue of state-sponsored superpowers. We've established that giving them to the armed forces is a terrible idea because soldiers only have two uses, killing people and being the main characters in gritty coming-of-age dramas. But perhaps a better idea would be to give superpowers to the local law enforcement. Admittedly, yes, it would only be truly essential if the community was in a state of constant gang violence and martial law, or at the very least if there are major congestion problems, and at all other times they'd just be giving random breath tests at 60 miles an hour or returning stray dogs to the pound by flinging them over arm from half a mile away. But think of the boost to the tourist trade. Of course, if you go this route, you have to make doubly sure that they're not the sort of superpowers that make you go insane, because there's no worse publicity than Officer Hyperion going feral during a photo op and decapitating five Japanese children with a single throw of his hat. Crackdown 2 is the sequel to Crackdown. See, this is the kind of vigorous research that makes me the hard-hitting professional journalist I am. A sandbox game for the early days of the Xbox 360 about superpowered policemen tasked to bring down three highly organized criminal gangs by punching all their members off of high places. But now it's sequel time and we've got a whole new city to... Oh no, wait, it's precisely the same city. I suspect the level design team just took the old world map from Crackdown 1, sprinkled bits of it with soot, then clocked off to go home and weep into their timesheets. And instead of three gangs, now there's just one. And instead of the intense boss battles with gang leaders, now there's just mutants gobbing on your shoes. I miss the days when a sequel having more stuff in it than the original was something that was taken as read. I thought that was the formula. First game makes the money, second game uses the money to expand, usually it's not till the third game that you really knuckle down to start ruining everything. The plot, such as it is, involves you, an agent of the agency called Agent, sent into the city some years after the defeat of the gangs in the first game to take on a revolutionary cell called The Cell, and also contend with a race of mutant zombie freaks called The Freaks. Who the fuck is in charge of naming things in Pacific City? Probably on reflection the same people who came up with Pacific City. Anyway, I don't think it's too much of a spoiler to say that the agency is secretly evil. I mean, when you have a superpowered civil authority that operates out of a building the size of the Earth Mother's most exotic sex aid, fighting a scrappy civilian revolutionary group from the inner city slums, one's sympathies are very rarely expected to side with the former. But this never really comes to anything. The plot in Crackdown 2 is like a light shower of rain taking place outside a prison cell with a very small window. Occasionally you can look over and catch a little glimpse of it, but it's probably not that amazing. The only character with a face and a name is the rebel leader, and she only shows up at the very end. And by the way, when the enemy leader is an attractive young woman, that's a good sign you're on the wrong side. If fiction has taught me anything, the righteous ones tend to be better looking, and generally white. Really though, Crackdown 2 doesn't have a story. It has a setting, but no structure. It's less like riding a water slide from a beginning to an end, and more like wallowing in a big jacuzzi full of gunfights. Your sole mandatory objective is to activate a number of magic problem-solving devices that you defend for a few minutes from waves of zombies before it explodes and wipes them all out like World of Warcraft subscribers in direct sunlight. Almost a set piece from a Gears of War game, but repeated about 10 times. The world is also full of race challenges, enemy strongholds, and hidden collectibles, all of which have no purpose but stat building. And yes, it's fun to jump around on rooftops collecting orbs like a reverse Easter bunny. Yes, it's fun to power slide through crowds of zombies as their disembodied privates roll over your windshield like floppy hailstones. Yay, it may indeed be fun to kill a rebel by throwing the corpse of his estranged daughter at his head, but it's a fleeting kind of fun while you still have 5 million other rebels shooting at you, and not all of them have family on hand. Without structure, all the game can do is wait for you to get bored and do the same thing one always ends up doing when a sandbox runs out of appeal: climb to the highest point in the map and hurl yourself into the sea. Crackdown 1 was a great game. It too had a strong emphasis on fucking around, but when you were ready to grow up and behave, there was a structured challenge curve in which you besiege and kill everyone on the Kingpin's Christmas card list until the Kingpin's own defenses are weakened enough to risk taking on. An important goal makes fucking around all the sweeter when you could imagine your administrator impotently shaking his gnarled fist as you waste another hour throwing trains at children. Crackdown 2's critical path is so unabashedly token that fucking around is all we have. I can only assume the developers used all the time they saved by copy-pasting the previous world map to sit around flicking each other's ears all day. He couldn't have added some different set pieces or some different enemy types. At the very least, he could have fixed Crackdown 1's control issues, like the auto-target that remains stubbornly glued to the Volkswagen Beetle next to the dude who just fired 3 health bars worth of homing missiles at you, or the temperamental ledge-grabbing system that often leaves you falling down the front of a building praying as the brickwork sands hands off your face. Crackdown 2 seems to subscribe to the school of thought that having a multiplayer focus lets you skimp on content. See also Lost Planet 2 and that horrible Unreal Tournament Quake 3 Arena period in shooters that Half-Life thankfully rescued us from. To go back to this analogy, having a jacuzzi by yourself is nice if a bit indulgent, but add more people and now you're sharing everyone's filth and have to be careful you don't put your hand on anyone's dick. I've got nothing against multiplayer as a concept, but you shouldn't try to make it carry a game because there are logistical problems. Me and my friends have enough trouble splitting the bill after pizza, and navigating labyrinths of lobbies and servers is rarely worth the effort when everyone would rather just stick Guitar Hero on. And joining random online games is like walking into an aviary full of nitrous oxide and trying to play Scrabble with the kookaburras while they stand around having sex with your mum. They say that money is the root of all evil, but somehow I doubt Mrs. Hitler was being impregnated by a roll of Deutschmarks. The saying works better if you replace money with rich businessmen in tight suits who won't even put 20 cents in a gumball machine if they can't expect a return of investment, and evil with bland semi-action adventure clones kneeling on the bed of a dried up watering hole licking the dirt for moisture, and is with R if you want to be grammatically correct. It's hard to find innovation in big budget mainstream games when you can't make a single designer suggestion without triplicate proof that Gears of War did it, and this illustrates the importance of independent development. We're fortunate to live in a time when it's never been easier to get exposure for new and innovative ideas, and I'd like to grant a little more exposure to two recent Xbox Live Arcade titles, starting with Death's Bank, a Diablo clone. Actually, that's not completely fair. Just in case the title hasn't told you everything you needed to know yet, Death's Bank is more like Diablo mixed with hack and slash and marinated in Monkey Island overnight, which makes sense because it was served up by the same chef, Ron Gilbert. You are the stalwart hero Death's Bank. You have come to a faraway land of fantasy in order to acquire the mysterious artifact known only as the Artifact, and do your bit to help the downtrodden along the way, with most of the downtrodden all needing the kind of help that involves killing strangely specific numbers of certain kinds of monster. Death's Bank is that particular breed of parody that basically just does all the same things as the kind of thing it's parodying, but occasionally points to itself and goes, "Hey everybody, look!" Then the Wayans brothers make a parody of that, full of bodily fluids and pop culture references, and the collective IQ of the general public drops another precious notch. Death's Bank is a game that's all about its flavor text. Every character has a funny dialogue tree, and every item has a funny description. Ha ha, my sides. It'd just be nice to be able to read the fucking things. It's got the Dead Rising problem of assuming that everyone either owns a 6-foot TV, or sits right in front of it with their forehead super glued to the screen, and all the text and details are smaller than a gnat's tit. The largest enemies are actually far easier to kill, because you can tell the difference between when they're raising their arm to attack, or when they're just pointing out an interesting cloud to a friend, so they're easier to counterattack. Otherwise, it's extremely hard to escape a battle without losing health when you're surrounded by little yappy murderers who look exactly like the crisp packets all over the floor. That's why it gets more and more irritating to have to sit and eat food to restore your health every 10 seconds, since attacking or being attacked at any point while eating makes Death's Bank throw his lunch unfinished to the ground. Here is a man in dire need of a foam dome full of beef casserole, and it doesn't take long for the hilarious food-eating noise to start grating when it sounds like a dog eating watermelon next to your ear while discussing his favourite arsehole smells. I guess a recommendation for Death's Bank depends entirely on whether you feel a game can be carried by humour, because there's certainly a lot of that, but strip it away and it's just a slightly annoying hack-and-slash RPG, but hey, too many games these days are about scowling serious tosspots with so many brooms up their ass they could lean against a wall and call themselves a cleaning cupboard, so perhaps humour is enough. Personally, I stopped playing because gameplay just got too dreary and the voice acting rubbed me up like a bed full of biscuit crumbs, so let's move on. And speaking of games that take themselves too seriously, our second XBLA game is Limbo, an arty platformer developed by Manic Depressives for Manic Depressives. There's a bit of an unspoken rule on Kasplar that the easiest way to get critically acclaimed is to make a bleak arty platformer about a small child with an oversized head in a big scary world, with bonus points if they have to lose their innocence at some point. Anyway, in Limbo you play the silhouette of a small child with an oversized head in a silhouette of a big scary world, and your objective is to keep moving right until the game says stop. And bleak is an understatement. This is bleak multiplied by grim to the power of Hot Topic. Absolutely everything is trying to kill you in needlessly gory ways. Because of the nature of the art style, there's no way of knowing they will do so until your disembodied head is ricocheting off a suicidal pallbearer's hat. There are enough autosaves that this isn't really a problem, and it all adds to this wonderful sense of oppression and loneliness that I as a horror fan found quite stirring in my pants. There's a sequence early on involving a spider that I won't spoil, but if there's not at least one part of your conscious mind loudly evacuating its bowels throughout, then cancel this afternoon's appointment because you appear to have died. Insects are a recurring theme in the game because that's exactly what you are, a tiny, scared, insignificant insect gazing up incomprehensively at the towering food chain at the bottom of which you lie. The world is massive, cruel, and unsympathetic, and the best you could hope for is to end up in a hedgehog poo, so man up, your highness. Gameplay-wise, it's kind of like the evil parallel universe equivalent of Little Big Planet, with challenges based solely around platforming and pulling boxes around. After a while, the game abandons arachnid-based atmosphere building and just becomes a sequence of physics puzzles, which was a little disappointing. I like how the game never repeats itself, but it is very short, especially for 1200 gamer points. It's like it ends at the very instant it runs out of ideas, clapping its hands and going, "Right, that's your lot, here's your disappointing ending. Go home now, don't look back, you mustn't dwell." I guess a recommendation for Limbo depends entirely on whether you feel a game can be carried by apocalyptic despair. The final question, I suppose, is which of the two games I recommend most? Well, if you're rich enough to patronise the arts now and then, put on your tuxedo, uncork some pricey Chablis, and experience for yourself an evening of Limbo. But if you're more in the market for a bulk buy economy brand kind of entertainment, then order out for a barbecue meat lovers with a 2-litre Coke and try Death's Bank. Alternatively, if neither option appeals and you'd prefer something bland and unchallenging, then why not try eating a dick? Ooh, Yahtzee moos the farmyard cattle. We'd love to hear your opinion on StarCraft 2. All right then, you passive-aggressive future casseroles. In my considered opinion, StarCraft 2 can suck on a space tailpipe. I'm taking a holiday in my no StarCraft 2 clubhouse, and you're all invited to come up the rope ladder and join me. I've got nothing against real-time strategy, except that everyone who plays them is obviously a massive coward, content to order soldiers to their deaths in fiery shootouts that are all taking place on the far end of a space telescope, and therefore so is every country that likes StarCraft. That's right, Korea, I'm calling you out, but I had enough trouble commanding a Cub Scout troop, so strategy is a genre I've just never gotten into. Sadly, it's August, and the release schedule has settled into its annual tonguing the bottom of an empty KFC bargain bucket for nourishment phase, so fuck it, I'm just gonna clamp my hands over my ears and talk about a game I really like. It seems like all my favourite games were on the PS2, but before that ugly black VCR starts getting too smug, the PS2 just had a massive game library because it had a good third-party support. And for every Killer 7 and Silent Hill 2, there were 50 Red Factions and Onimushas and Silent Hill 4s. But if any company embodied the PS2 at its peak, it would be Team Ico. Their first game, narcissistically titled Ico, was a game that sounds fucking awful on paper, a platform puzzler that's been protecting a princess who can't fight, jump, or walk and chew gum at the same time from continually respawning monsters apparently made from Vegemite. But it's tolerable because there's this very clear sense that the princess is part of something far bigger than is immediately apparent, and more importantly, keeps her mouth shut. Am I right, fellas? It's just a bit more sophisticated than the usual approach to romance in games, which is to say, here is your woman, you love her because A, we say you do, B, she's the only thing in this plot with an X chromosome, and C, she's built like two shrink-wrapped bowling balls arguing over a sandwich. Now, in Shadow of the Colossus, the love interest spends the majority of the game flat on her back. Seems Team Ico have a rather traditional view of gender roles. Suppose we shall be grateful she wasn't wearing gingham and cooking us pancakes. But actually, her role is to just lie there driving the plot. You are a hot young stud who has brought his questionably alive lady friend to a forbidden land in order to request that an imprisoned demon bring her back to life, because these arrangements always work out beautifully for all concerned. The demon's terms are that you search the forbidden land for 16 giant monsters and kill each and every one with a sword that by rights they would barely register as a splinter, and if you should happen to notice a mysterious black poison being released with each victory that slowly corrupts your body, then don't worry, that just means it's working. Or you could always just let it go, dig her a nice grave and look into online dating, but no, giant monster black poison it is. This is what they call true love, apparently, something I've always felt is virtually indistinguishable from brain damage. Shadow of the Colossus is usually filed under action-adventure, like everything else that's hard to classify, but really, it defies genre. The gameplay is divided between adventuring alone through the silent wilderness and the 16 tussles with monsters so large you could hollow out their carcasses and repurpose them as low-income housing. In the former, everything's peaceful and contemplative, with no combat and no puzzling besides navigating an occasional mountain that sits obliviously between you and your destination like a fat guy in a cinema, and in the latter, everything's noisy and intense like you're playing Hungry Hungry Hippos backstage at a Dragon Force gig. It creates an effective contrast, like riding a bike down a long and peaceful country road, and every other 100 yards, the bike turns into a bear. Contrast is important. You quickly get sick of ice cream cake when it's the only thing you eat, and action games lose effectiveness when they're just a steady stream of nasties lining up for sucker punches. That's why Half-Life starts off with half an hour of listening to scientists complaining about the coffee before any monsters show up for a manicino. The monster fights themselves are equal parts boss fight and puzzle platforming section, each of them utterly unique in their own ways, but generally the first phase is to get onto their bodies, and the second is to climb up their armpits' hair to their weak spot and administer acupuncture while they try to shake you off like New Age dandruff. Leaping off a speeding horse onto a giant low-flying snake thing and hauling yourself up to its face to stab it in the eye is a gameplay experience that clicking your space marines over to the Zerg stronghold can't really hope to match, and a dwindling grip gauge showing how much longer you can cling to the monster's thrashing beard adds another basting of adrenaline. What I love about the Colossi is that they actually feel colossal. They move ponderously around, sending out tremors with each step, their ancient husks richly detailed with dirt and plant life. They really do feel like something that has been sleeping in the ground for so long they've almost become part of the landscape, now rudely awoken and sleepily pawing at you like you're an unusually aggressive snooze button. You want to keep playing just to see what the next monster looks like, which few other games can claim. Ooh, maybe the next enemy soldier will be wearing a slightly differently brown uniform. Oh shit! But as I keep saying, I've yet to play a perfect game, which would probably be a Prince of Persia sequel where the main character is a giant disembodied breast. So Shadow of the Colossus has its gripes. One or two of the Colossi phone it in a bit, especially the ones that are only about the size of a bull, which is disappointing when held against flying, snaky, speeding, horsey, leapy, stabby wahey, like a big gift box containing 5,000 packing peanuts and a Kinder Surprise. And it can get very frustrating to fall off a monster's bald spot because your grip gauge ran out and have to start climbing all over again, the final boss being a particular hedgehog in my prostate for this reason. You can increase your grip gauge by shooting arrows into lizards in the overworld, which strikes me as incredibly arbitrary, like swatting a fly at work and inexplicably getting better at photocopying. But these are the complaints of a tiny irrelevant mouse clinging to the back of a roaring lion with a jetpack. There's nothing else like it, and it's just damn good. Damn good. I have a problem with driving games. I like them, but I'm terrible at them. It's the exact opposite to the problem I have with fellatio. It might be because I don't drive IRL because I work from home and live in the city and doubt I would find it easier to get around if I were 6 feet wide and constantly farting carbon monoxide. I don't know how your mum does it, but driving really fast speaks to something primal and instinctive in the human brain. Takes us back to those desperate times when a feeble-minded proto-human was putting the finishing touches to his new wheel, when he'd hear a charging mammoth tearing up the undergrowth behind him and have no choice but to leap astride his invention and speed down the valley slopes to safety. Yes, life was tough in Thatcher's Britain, but you know what might have made things even even more exciting if the mammoth, the wheel, and the valley had all subsequently exploded. Which brings me to split-second velocity, or rather split-stroke-second, because that's how it's written. So what the fuck does that mean, Disney Interactive Studios? Split or second? Do we have to pick one? Or does the game alternate between being themed around standard units of time measurement and serving suggestions for bananas? Anyway, it's an extreme racing game. You do know the hyphen is the horizontal one, right? Look down, it's right next to the zero. I know it's hard to focus when Mickey Mouse is badgering you for results, but honestly. Anyway, it's an extreme racing game, with extreme in this case being pronounced while throwing up the horns and making a look on your face like you've just felt the onset of cardiac arrest. The game opens with the announcement that it's all a big fantasy and you definitely shouldn't try to recreate it, which gave me pause for thought, because to recreate it, you'd need a fleet of high-performance cars, several thousand tons of explosives, some ex-military helicopters, and your own private city. And I think if you're that rich, you're beyond needing video games for entertainment. You'd probably get your jollies by buying two poverty-stricken pregnant women and telling them that neither are getting out of the arena alive until one has eaten the other's fetus. The premise of Split Second is that you're taking part in a TV show that is the inevitable result of ratings-conscious producers, which combines the appeal of NASCAR and Saving Private Ryan. You are racing presumably against several people with terminal illnesses through a city that apparently nobody liked very much, bits of which are rigged to explode as you drive past them. And because it's set up like a TV show, a lot of the game communicates in the mysterious language of television. Instead of a campaign, it's called a season. Instead of a stage, it's called an episode. And at the end of each episode, there's a little preview of the next one, full of dramatic music and flashy edits. And that Zack Snyder thing where the camera goes really fast, then really slow, then really fast again, like the cameraman lost the manual to his electric wheelchair. All of which makes about as much sense as the episode recaps in Alan Wake. I already bought the game, Split Second. You don't have to keep advertising yourself, unless your target audience is people with attention deficit disorder, who keep their TV in the same room as their disco ball collection, which frankly wouldn't surprise me. The unique gameplay selling point for driving repeatedly around in a circle is a technology that has been long perfected, is that if the racers in front of you are shaking their tailpipes at you ostentatiously, you can make a nearby structure explode like a cross between John McClane and Dick Dastardly and teach them humility. The problem with this as a strategy is that it's a lot more arbitrary than, say, just firing a great big missile from your car, but I guess there's considerably less deniability in that scenario. There's no guarantee you'll even hit an opponent, and the equal chance you'll blow your own stupid ass off the road. When I did hit someone, more than once, the subsequent burnout-style slow-motion close-up of my victory caused me to fail to notice a big fuck-off wall that was rushing up to make my acquaintance. And naturally, you're not the only one with access to the explosion's wishing well, and you can be in a solid first place for three laps only for someone to drop a fucking cargo container full of rhinos on your head 10 yards from the finish line. Maybe we could just toss a fucking coin to decide the winner and all get to go home quicker, then we wouldn't have to blow up any more orphanages. There are a handful of other gameplay modes that are all variations on a theme of avoid things that explode, whether it be barrels falling out the back of a truck, or a helicopter firing missiles, or indeed a helicopter firing missiles that you can then deflect back at the helicopter like you're playing incredibly rich people's tennis. I think I figured this out. World peace must have been declared, and this is the method decided upon to short-sightedly use up all the military hardware while simultaneously keeping the public distracted from the machinations of the secret world government. There's 12 episodes with 6 events apiece, but the game producer's whips weren't long or painful enough to coerce more than a handful of level maps out of the designer, so the game constantly repeats. I guess it really is like a TV show. You'll revisit the same courses about 30 times before you even hit sweeps week, which is fairly typical for racing games, but could you not have occasionally used the same map but with a different course? Even just run the same course but in reverse. I doubt any of the target audience would notice if you kept the flashing lights going or stuck up some tits on some billboards. At the end of the explosion-filled day, Split Stroke Second Colon Velocity has one idea that fails to hold it up. A thin crust of sugar over a tasteless creme brulee made of water and paste. The intention was presumably to base the game around spectacle, but after you've raced the same course for the third time and realised that it's always the same things exploding, then the spectacle becomes a testicle. After a while, I was driving on automatic, lulled into a hypnotic trance by buzzing motors and sweet drifts, surfacing momentarily to screech with rage whenever a random exploding car park cost me the lead. It's punishing success, that's what it is. Ayn Rand would be very upset. Too often, the outcomes of the races seem more dependent on luck than anything else, plus the flashy presentation is so blatantly designed to appeal to the very lowest of the cultural brows that I just can't shake the feeling that the mere act of touching the game kind of makes me a prick. I never watched Transformers. As a kid, I exclusively watched black and white Eastern European cartoons where everything was an analogy for capitalism. I say this to give the following review context, because I know there are going to be some nostalgia-blinded viewers who slept each night safe in the arms of their Optimus Prime duvet right up to the age of 28, who will take offense when I say I feel somewhat uninvested in the argument of whether my stereo could beat up my microwave. What I don't get is why people get so affectionate and defensive for Transformers when literally the only reason it existed was not to enrich or inspire you, but to sell you gimmicky toys. Hey, fanboys, Transformers only loved you as long as you had limited control over your parents' disposable income. It's like you were all hooked up to milking machines, and instead of complaining, you all painted your milking machines different colours and put stickers on them, and argued over whose milking machine was best. But I suppose these days, the entire entertainment industry regards most individuals as nothing more than a big consuming mouth wearing designer jeans full of money, so what the fuck? Transformers War for Cybertron. Gather round and consume away, you big jeans-wearing mouth cattle things. 7 billion light-years from the nearest relatable character, there's a big robot planet that looks like a magic eight ball had sex with a diesel engine, where war has broken out between the Autobots and the Decepticons, colour-coded proud red and fabulous purple, respectively. Bearing in mind my ignorance of Transformers canon, the reason for this war, as far as I could tell, was a largely ideological one. The Autobots think everyone should be nice, and the Decepticons think everyone should be dick pistons. A doctrine to which the Decepticons seem almost religiously devoted. Megatron in particular can't string two words together without sounding like a panto villain. Even if he were complimenting his mother on her potato bake, he'd still threaten her with disintegration if the apple crumbles not up to standard. It's a third-person shooter split between two campaigns, meaning you spend 5 missions wrecking shit as the Decepticons and 5 missions fixing it all again as the Autobots. The differences between the two campaigns are subtle. In fact, you could be forgiven for saying there aren't any. But while both sides have the same weapons, face the same enemies, and basically just spend all their time jogging back and forth into cover shooting anything that's shooting back, the Decepticon characters all constantly repeat the same asinine self-aggrandizing dialogues until you want to funnel hydrochloric acid down your ears, while the Autobots... Oh wait, you know, maybe it's not too late to get everyone around a negotiating table. The Decepticons are all trying to corrupt everything with today's plot-convenient substance, Dark Energon, although this corruption only ever seems to manifest as big black spikes growing out of things. It's like saying my lawn has been corrupted by dandelions. Transformers, of course, must transform, or they're just shouty drama students with cereal boxes on their feet. The residents of Cybertron all have the ability to turn into vehicles. God knows why this was necessary on their home planet. Maybe everyone just got sick of dealing with second-hand car salesmen. There's potential in this for unique dual gameplay, maybe switching between third-person combat and stunt driving like Jason Statham and every movie he's ever made. This opportunity was left starving in its crib while the rest of the game sat and drank itself to death. In car mode, you control exactly the same as in biped mode, including the ability to strafe, bizarrely, except you can go a bit faster by holding down the left trigger, so basically transforming is just a needlessly complicated sprint function. There are one or two levels where you play as flying robots, but that just feels like swimming did in a 90s FPS, and you can't look all the way up, so when I had to ascend a vertical shaft, I could only smash my face into a wall and grind my way up. You know what? Dark Void was a better Transformers game than Transformers is. All you need to do is replace the main bloke with a big chunky robot that you can't relate with, which wouldn't even be that much of a shift. The game borrows somewhat from the aesthetic of the Transformers movies, which is rather like borrowing the aesthetic of a naked homeless man doodling on his stomach with his own shit. So the robots are all big, clanky, dirty monsters, and while this looks perfectly fine, well, while this looks distinct at least against human cities and Shia LaBeouf's big, stupid, chubby, gormless, incredibly punchable, ooh, I'm only in this because the producers think we need a character the audience can identify with, and isn't that just a massive implied insult face? In this game, we have dirty robot monsters fighting against the background of dirty robot environments. Do you see how this might cause an issue? The visuals are such a fucking mess, you can't tell what's an enemy and what's an air conditioner until one starts maintaining the temperature and the other calls you rude names. And do you remember 2 weeks ago when I said Shadow of the Colossus is good because the giant monsters actually feel big? That's exactly what Transformers lacks. You fight a big lad called Omega Supreme as the Decepticons, and he just moves like a big ambulatory inflatable, and his voice just sounds like a normal bloke droning into your ear at a crowded party. People will say I didn't like the game because I don't care about Transformers. Well, the point is, this was the game's chance to make me care about Transformers, and it cocked it up. Tie-in games in the past have been good enough on their own merits to make me interested in the subject matter. All I'm seeing here is a bunch of tumble dryers bumping into each other under overblown disco lighting. The only possible recommendation I could give it is that there's a certain absurd humour to be found in hearing all this overblown dramatic Lord of the Rings dialogue coming from the mouths of what appear to be boxes on legs. But apart from that, it's as ugly as a radiator covered in robots sick with the physics of cardboard balloons, and the one solitary thing that makes Transformers special, the whole transforming thing, lies smothered like Pavarotti's wife beneath rolls of a dull, repetitive third-person shooter. There, you may now email me to explain in close detail how the death of Optimus Prime was your generation's Othello. By the way, I'm on a holiday next week, so there won't be a video. I'm saying this now before anyone demands reparations in blood because they had to amuse themselves for 7 days. I've been quoted as saying that the cruelest thing you can do to an artist is tell them their work is perfect when it isn't. It's a policy that has gotten me thrown out of a lot of finger painting classes, but reflect on what huge masochists the developers of Kane and Lynch must be, famously having gotten Jeff Gerstmann fired from GameSpot for not realizing that the GameSpot Super Sellout Saver advertising package included a free happy ending on the review table. Solidarity, therefore, was the main ingredient in my root beer float of reasons why I didn't review Kane and Lynch 1, with a hefty scoop of the ice cream of Cuddin' to be arsed. But now Kane and Lynch 2 is out, I sincerely hope the publishers don't intend to follow the same policy as last time, because if they do, there will not be a reviewer left employed by the end of the month. Or to put that another way, Kane and Lynch 2 is worse than deep-fried tampons. Still, it doesn't hurt to play safe, so here's a nice quote for the box art. Kane and Lynch 2 Dog Days is a game so intense it literally physically assaults you, because after playing for the 4 or 5 hours necessary to complete it, it gave me a headache like I've been skull-fucked with Pinocchio's splintery todger. The reason for this is because the game pretends like it's being filmed on a handheld camera, apparently held by some unseen third character, an aspiring documentary filmmaker who no one ever acknowledges, and is either a heavy drinker or constantly busting for a piss because he wavers like a lifeboat with delirium tremens. And when you try sprinting, Christ, it's like his kneecaps have been replaced with slinkies, and I suspect he found his camcorder in a bin. Bright light sources have vertical bar lens flare things that look awful, and characters all have this weird black haze around their heads like they're attracting swarms of flies. I know they're deliberately trying to make it look terrible, but they succeed so well, it's actually sickening. If you want to smear shit on your face to make an ironic statement, statement, then more power to you, but you still smell like arse. Okay, I'm going to establish a new rule now. You know cover-based combat? You're not allowed to base your whole game around that anymore. You can still have it in all its chest-high wall pop-up shooting gallery tedium, but you've got to have something else, even if it's just a Cooking Mama-style minigame during the celebratory post-firefight barbecue. Why? Because it's boring, it's overdone, and I feel sorry for the artist. They go to all the trouble researching appropriate outfits for periods and setting, drawing the concept art, painstakingly modelling and animating the characters, and then what? They get stuck behind bits of wall on the far sides of murky rooms, and you might as well have just dressed them in cardboard boxes and bunny slippers. In all fairness, Kane & Lynch 2 does occasionally pretend to be a stealth game, the kind of stealth game where every enemy on the map becomes alerted to your exact position the moment one guard spots half an inch of your pimply bum. You know, the shit kind of stealth game. At all other times, it's got nothing but same old cover-based shooting, and technically doesn't even have that. I thought the prerequisite of cover combat is that when you're in cover, the enemy can't shoot you, but Kane & Lynch beg to differ. You'd think they'd be better at tucking their heads in, what with all the time they spend sniffing their own farts. The plot is so flimsy, it's painful, like a man with no bones in his arms trying to serve you coffee. Kane & Lynch, gritty realism's answer to Laurel and Hardy, if Laurel occasionally forgot to take his meds and shot the hostages, are in Shanghai for an arms deal, and while idly passing the time shooting some locals in a very gritty, realistic way, accidentally kill someone they shouldn't have and provoke the most powerful man in China. Ho ho, will those bumbling ninnies ever do anything right? A man so powerful he can enlist wave after wave of gang members, then police, then the fucking army, in the pursuit of his personal revenge, they all having nothing better to do, what with China being such a notoriously peaceful, unmilitarized country and everything. From there, the plot is like a recent car accident victim, staggering back and forth with bits of windscreen in its face for a while before finally collapsing and bleeding out into a roadside ditch. Kane and Lynch fight off various flavors of heavy, then more show up, then they swear at each other, then the cameraman takes another pull of cheap whiskey, repeat. Events have the mark of bad storytelling in that they rely almost entirely on coincidence and behavior that would take considerable solvent sniffing to seem rational. Kane and Lynch are arrested by the army and are taken through the city center in a convoy of helicopters rather than in, say, one car, so they hijack their helicopter and immediately begin strafing nearby skyscrapers where all the office workers apparently stash rocket launchers in the water coolers. Then they crash on the building that just happens to contain the big boss they've made an enemy of, and despite having spent the entire game desperately trying to escape China in fear of this guy, they suddenly decide they might as well just drop in and kill him. You know, while they happen to be in the neighborhood. The Chinese army helicopters then continue strafing the building, apparently because Kane and Lynch made it look like so much fun, which would be difficult to explain to your boss even if said boss wasn't currently in the building, alone, unguarded, and making no effort to evacuate the building that is under direct aerial assault. Not the sort of thing that's going to look good on the quarterly employee evaluation, is it? And the confrontation with the big boss isn't even the climax. The game just potters around for another mission to pad out the pathetic playtime, constantly checking its watch before going, fuck it, that'll do. And I swear this is true, the final boss fight is two dogs. The biggest threat in the game could have been outwitted by chucking a fucking bonio at it. And then it just ends. Cuts are black. The characters have achieved nothing, learnt nothing, and will hopefully now jump in a big black hole and return to nothing. Just as the visuals succeed too well at being deliberately hideous, the protagonists succeed too well at being deliberately wankers. There's nothing fun about the game. No light relief, just one piece of nauseating unpleasantness after another, like a roadside cafe breakfast special by Jeffrey Dahmer. I know IO Interactive are better than this. Hitman Blood Money was a baldy-headed barrel of fun. Since then, though, IO were bought out by Square Enix, so I'm gonna blame them. Fuck off, Square Enix. Kane & Lynch 2 sucks so many dicks it now breathes spunk instead of air. Once again, I astound myself with my growing powers of clairvoyance because I was able to accurately predict the entire story of Mafia 2 using only the fact that it's this game about the Mafia. The main character, I foretold with the game's box to my forehead, will start the game licking mildew off his landlady's crystallized vagina to make rent and will be lured into organized crime by the money, the clothes, the pretty cars, the fast whores, etc. But after a brief heyday, will be ordered to kill a friend, or a friend will be ordered to kill them, and they will realize that crime does not pay. Except for all the money, and the clothes, and the pretty cars, and the fast whores, etc. I have never seen a Mafia story where a bloke joins the Mafia and then everything is lovely forever. Why does society insist on demonizing organized crime? We all agree prohibition was a stupid law, right? So why is it socially acceptable to crave a nice cup of tea in the morning or a cigarette after a nobbing, but the moment I try to pound half a kilo of smack into my eyeballs, everyone thinks there's something wrong with me? Mafia 2 is a game about the Mafia. They were going to call it Quest for the Sausage Fountain, but you know how people are, you have to spell everything out. Following the adventures of a European immigrant named Vito Scaletti, who arrives in the big city and enters into various criminal pursuits with his fat best friend Joe something or other. Events are largely unconnected to Mafia 1, although there is one memorable crossover scene showing that Vito had an extremely brief appearance in the previous game, which I thought was a nice little touch. I even went back and looked at the scene again in Mafia 1, and the characters kind of looked like how they do in Mafia 2, except that they'd all been hit in the face with a shovel a few times because this was PS2 era graphics. Anyway, Vito and Joe join a Mafia family, get a whole bunch of pretty cars and fast whores, and then everything is lovely forever. Or that could just have been the point when the PCP kicked in. Those attentive motherfuckers among you may have grasped from the previous paragraph that somewhere down the line from this speeding monologue, a comparison to Grand Theft Auto 4 lies lashed and shrieking to the railroad tracks, but the more I played Mafia 2, the less apt this comparison became. For starters, GTA 4 actually let you do shit. Mafia 2 is technically a sandbox in the same way that the occupant of a high-security prison van driving through Blackpool is technically a holiday maker. I'm not sure why Mafia 2 and indeed Mafia 1 felt they needed to be open world because they're both heavily story-based linear sequences of missions, and largely the only activity available between missions is schlepping to the next one through the same dull scenery. People have suggested to me that this is to build an atmosphere of realism and highlight that life in organized crime was really just a sobering routine day job, to which I would say, piss off! This is a game. Games are fun. I want to knob prostitutes while singing songs from Bugsy Malone and say forget about it without irony. You know, after a while, day job is exactly the right word for it. Virtually every chapter starts with Vito waking up in the morning and driving to work. Work involves being led around by the nose following a linear sequence of instructions and then doing a bit of cover-based combat if you're very good. And the shooting eventually becomes just as routine as an office job. An office job where all you do is file bullets under faces all day. Then at the end of your shift, the game instructs you to drive straight home with nothing to do en route but collect Playboy centerfolds that the adult equivalent of the Easter Bunny has left lying around before having a quick sandwich and a wank before bed. Some people have said this should be judged as an interactive drama rather than a game, but this only works if the drama repeatedly switches between two different theatres that are 5 minutes drive from each other. It feels unnecessarily padded. Give me some credit. You don't have to make me drive the guy home every bloody night. I'm not going to assume he's going to drop where he stands and spend the night snoring away next to the shallow grave he just filled in. Goodfellas didn't feel it necessary to show us Joe Pesci flossing the babies out of his teeth every morning. Now, while the police in GTA 4 are apparently trained in Baghdad and won't turn on the siren for anything less than an IED detonating under their grandmother's rocking chair, Mafia 2's cops actually come after you for driving over the speed limit and running red lights, which I didn't mind because the odd high-speed chase did a lot to liven up Vito's morning commute. You see, the reason why I don't buy the interactive drama thing is that my favourite experiences in the game came when it went off-script, like when I didn't have enough money for the mission and took it upon myself to rob some fancy clothing stores, entering exciting standoffs with police before nicking one of the suits on sale and instantly losing my wanted level because the cops all have paving stones for brains. Or the one bit where I had to improvise my way across the city at night with a wanted level, no money, no car, and dressed only in a vest and Thundercats boxer shorts. When the game actually embraces its sandbox nature, it becomes halfway exhilarating, but then it lassos you back into line with more linear cover-based combat missions before you can have more than the regulation amount of fun. As for the story it's so proud of, I'm underwhelmed. Vito isn't exactly Jean Valjean. He's just a dark-haired white guy in a game that seems to be populated exclusively by them. The only way you can tell him apart is that he's the only one being followed around by a film crew and a retro 50s soundtrack. All he ever does is go along with things, like whatever the Sicilian word for bitch is, without the slightest flicker of emotion disturbing his pretty boy good looks. In the film, he'd be played by Keanu Reeves or a big balsa wood cutout with greasy hair. I wouldn't say Mafia 2 is a bad game, I'm just not sure it knows what it wants to do. And the ending's a disappointment. Without wishing to spoil, it's like if The Shawshank Redemption ended while Tim Robbins was still covered in poo in a pipe. After reaching the crime does not pay phase of the standard Mafia storyline, the game just sort of cuts out halfway through resolving everything. I'm not about to claim that I can get a complete handle on a game just by reading the box blurb, although I wish I could because it'd free up a lot of my time and my bathroom isn't going to clean itself, but after 3 whole misspent years of pausing for breath between takes, I am starting to recognise a few recurring warning signs. My suspicion that Metroid Other M might gargle gonads was first raised when the blurb prominently boasted features fully voiced movies. Now, when you're trying to sell a game, I would remind you a prominently interactive medium, with the non-interactive element, that evokes the image of a marketer despondently rolling their head back and forth along a keyboard. And furthermore, if the only selling point you can think of for the cinematics is that they have voices, like every film made since 1927, then it's like saying you have nice hair when forced to compliment the appearance of a squinting buck-toothed hunchback. Other M is a new installment of the Metroid series, developed third-party style by Team Ninja, who are most notably responsible for Dead or Alive Extreme Beach Volleyball, or as it's sometimes known, Boing! My main concern, therefore, was that they would nail gel-filled mouse pads to the front of Samus's power armor, but they didn't go that far. They just make the armor fall off every 10 seconds like it's held on with blue tack. You know, I always thought that after the initial shock at the end of the very first Metroid that Samus's breastplate was more appropriately named than you thought, the series' position had basically been that she's a lady, just deal with it, yo. But Other M just can't seem to stop banging on about it. The plot is somewhere between Aliens and G.I. Jane, and has a central theme of motherhood, which is woven into the narrative about as subtly as a sperm whale in an airplane luggage compartment. There's a stricken spaceship shaped like a baby's bottle, and referred to as a bottle ship, just in case you didn't catch it the first time, and Samus, clad in this season's most hideous shade of snot yellow, is called to it by what is referred to as a baby's cry, variety of distress signal, so named according to Samus's fully voiced narration because it's specifically designed to draw attention, as opposed presumably to all those distress signals that are designed to just kind of scoot by unnoticed. Up until this game, Samus was a silent protagonist, so the decision to give her a voice was one that needed to be carefully handled to avoid fanboys queuing up to piss into Team Ninja's letterbox. One way to mishandle the change, for example, would be to pick a voice actress who has undergone several amateur lobotomies and delivers every line of dialogue with all the searing emotion of someone in an old folks' home doing the monthly stocktake of oatmeal. But even if they got Brian Blessed in to redo every line like a Chaucerian soliloquy, it's been a while since I've seen such epically bad writing, even by the remedial at best general standards of video game dialogue. It's not quite as far down as Hideo Kojima's level, but it would see him very clearly through a glass-bottom boat, if you know what I mean. Of the many expressionless drones Robo Samus excretes from her mouthpipe, roughly 100% of them are clarifications of things that a narcoleptic retard could have already guessed. From Adam Stern Expression, Constant Swear,
swearing and repeated kicks to my face and stomach, I realized he must have been a bit upset about something.
While Team Ninja showed admirable restraint by not dressing Samus like a Playboy bunny, their attitudes to gender politics shine through. A character previously established to have a bold, independent spirit has to be surrounded by big, burly men in case she starts getting emotional and having periods, having to rescue her at one point when she starts freaking out at the sight of the recurring boss monster she's killed about 50 squintillion times throughout the series. And much has already been made of the power-up mechanic, that Samus already has them all in her overnight bag, but refuses to use them until her commanding officer, with whom she has surrogate daddy issues up the delicately sculpted arse, authorizes it. This leads to a rather notorious moment when Samus blunders through an extremely hostile atmosphere without protective clothing because daddy didn't specifically order her to wear some, putting her on the intellectual level of one of those robot vacuum cleaners. It's like every character put their retard hats on that morning by mistake. There's a mawkishly overdramatic scene in which a character sacrifices himself by bravely detaching and blowing up the entire Metroid wing of the spaceship with him inside. We'll let slide for now the issue of why exactly he had to be inside it to do this, but Metroids show up later on anyway, so he might as well have just stuck yellow and black tape over the door for all the good it did. Oh yes, and there's this murder mystery plot set up early on. Six different members of a military squad are introduced and established with names and slightly anemic personalities, but then it transpires that there's a traitor among them picking them off. You even have a boss fight with him, his face cunningly concealed by camera angles and bits of scenery. So do you want to know who the traitor turns out to be? So the fuck would I, because the game kind of forgets about this whole subplot and hopes you do too. Hey, wasn't there some intrigue from the first half of the game we were supposed to be resolving, Metroid Story Writer A? Doesn't ring a bell, Metroid Story Writer B. Now let's make Samus's suit fall off again so everyone can see her bum. On an educated guess though, the evil guy was probably the one with the evil moustache. I don't usually take this long to talk about the gameplay, but the bloated cancerous mass of the story's atrocity overshadows everything else. The gameplay's infinitely stronger in that it's merely bad. The power-ups are the standard Metroid kit with no original ideas, and the game world is a lot smaller and more linear than, say, Metroid Fusion. Shunning the analog stick in favour of a D-pad for 3D movement was a decision rooted in a Japanese love pillow restricting the supply of air to someone's brain, and having to constantly switch to first-person mode to use missiles feels as smooth and natural as deflecting bricks with your head while wearing another brick as an earring. But deflect enough bricks, and maybe the first-person mode will remind you of the vastly superior Metroid Prime. Better yet, just play Metroid Prime again and replicate the feeling of Other M by hiring a stripper to slam your head in a car door. Unless your head is trapped in some kind of sensory deprivation device, it kind of escaped your notice that video games have a slightly worse relationship with mainstream media than serial killers. Leaving aside the fact that in the eyes of many, half of them spurt blood like a malfunctioning sprinkler lodged in the throat of a hemophiliac, it's easy for us veteran nerds stuffed full of muscle memory to forget that to a total newcomer, the video game controller might as well be the cockpit of a jumbo jet. To the layman, games are frightening, and both media outlets and politicians have a tendency to exploit these fears to gain points with Joe Dumbface, especially in election years like, oh say for example, this one, and it seems like some old git is calling for game regulation every 10 minutes, but what can we do? Well, they are old gits, so we could conceivably just wait for them all to die, but in the meantime we have the Video Game Voters Network. The VGVN is an organization that lets American gamers get together and let their opinions be heard by legislators. It's true that there are people who see games as a convenient target, that there are many of them among politicians, and it may be true that one day such people will be remembered alongside those who tried to outlaw movies and novels and theater and dancing and those people who said the steam train would cause women to spontaneously die of shock in its wake like rows of screaming dominoes. But until that day, it's up to us to show non-gamers that just because games aren't boring doesn't mean they're different to books, and just because games aren't 2 hours long and written by overpaid chimpanzees doesn't mean they're different to films. They all fall under the constitutional right to free speech. If someone who wants to legislate the censorship of art and culture gets in this November, then the next thing you know, you're picking jackboots out of your teeth. Video games are the cutting edge of a whole new wave of creativity. Interactive storytelling, a development as artistically significant as the moment Picasso realized which end of a brush was which, and he couldn't even draw a proper face. The VGVN is important because games are too important to be left in the hands of the anti-fun brigade, and an armed uprising would only prove their bloody points. November will come sooner than you think, so now is the time to get off your asses, go to videogamevoters.org and sign up to do your bit. This might sound a bit weird, but hurdy-gurdy-boggly-boo. This also might sound a bit weird, but the thing that bothered me most about Halo Reach was that no one ever wore seatbelts. It started early on when I was wondering why these standard video game aircraft have to keep the side doors wide open all the time when you think a military vehicle should be designed to protect its occupants from enemy fire, when someone perched themselves loosely along the side and the thing took off before he could strap himself in, the camera presumably cutting away moments before the guy got hurled off and landed in somebody's hedge. And after that, I couldn't stop noticing it. There were several moments when people were standing or sitting on the end of the open ramp at the back of a large transporter as it took off, staring meaningfully at the retreating scenery and apparently having nailed their feet to the floor. This is the kind of bullshit that really takes me out of the story. I could barely enjoy the horrible plot, cliched characters, and repetitive gameplay. So rend your Master Chief t-shirt and sob wetly into your limited edition Cortana wank rags, Halo fans, because Halo Reach is the last Halo game. You'll just have to console yourself with Halo 1, Halo 2, Halo 3, Halo Wars, the toys, the comics, the expanded universe novels, the colouring book, and the his and hers matching beach towels, most of which you will apparently need to have gone through to understand what the fuck's going on in this game. I do respect Bungie for so firmly drawing a line under their popular series, which sits just above refuse a second helping of pancakes on the list of things things George Lucas will never do. But anyone who thinks this is the last we'll see of Halo clearly has no ambitions of joining the Microsoft Game Division's strategic planning department. I'm sure they'll be stashing this particular elderly corpse in the crawl space and cashing its pension checks long after Bungie have toddled off to make their long-awaited sequel to Oni. So Halo Reach is a prequel installment depicting the beginning of the Human Covenant War, and as such should be virtually impossible to spoil, because whenever Reach gets brought up in the other games and media and everything, it's referred to as a place where a whole lot of shit got fucked up. And everyone in this prequel seems to be fully aware of their ultimately doomed status too. No one's particularly surprised when the Covenant do show up, with incidentally all human characters immediately being totally familiar with the operation of Covenant weapons and vehicles. You'd almost think they'd just built this game off the engine of a previous one or something. And the story is focused on a small commando unit whose members spend the entire game having a prolonged who can have the noblest death competition. Oh come on, this isn't a spoiler. They wouldn't characterize this many NPCs if they weren't going to pick them off like after 8 minutes. The very first image in the game is a brief flash forward depicting your helmet lying discarded in the dust of battle-scarred terrain. What the fuck do you think happens in the end? Your character thrillingly and climactically gets a little bit hot. Halo and I haven't always seen eye to visor, me having in the past called it a boring, repetitive shooter with an impenetrable plot and a fanbase consisting of cunts who have survived so many cunt filtration attempts that they have evolved to a state of hypothetical meta-cunts. But I feel suddenly inclined to be charitable towards Halo Reach because it's the first shooter I've played in quite a long time that doesn't have cover-based combat and iron sight aiming, the two faces of the giant scrotum monster that has settled on mainstream gaming like a deflated hot air balloon. So I was ready to meet Halo Reach halfway, but you had to give a little for this relationship to work, Halo. For a game that styled itself Combat Evolved, you seem to have done very little of the second word since 2001. Same weapons, same enemies, same beach level, same grass level, same alien spaceship level, same horrible habit of suddenly insta-killing you every now and again, like when you have to reload and a bloke with an energy sword runs up and hacks off your courageously outward thrust nipples, or when a fireball from an artillery unit drops out of the sky and flattens you because you had popped into cover for 3/4 of a second to have a little cry. Having said that, there is some variety, but it comes and goes faster than an erection at a Bangkok strip joint. I'd heard there was some spaceship combat, which I was looking forward to, because the endangered genre of spaceship combat is my personal equivalent of the giant panda, but it consists of one measly token dogfight with a single enemy fleet, and then it's back on the ground in boring old gravity again. Well, that's not strictly true. There's also a bit later on where you can hop around in a jetpack, but again, it's over before your brain can get as far as the second O in Ooh, This Is Fun. The jetpack is part of a new system where you can swap out the sprint function in your armor for other abilities, usually a shield that means you can't move or attack while it's on, so it's about as much use as a cheeseburger at a fashion model convention. And if you've removed your sprint function, that just makes you doubly fucked when the energy sword nipple fiend is on the prowl. But isn't there multiplayer as well? Shut up, mouth shut now. We've been over this. A full price game has to stand up on single player because there are always factors in the way of multiplayer the game can't help. Like its servers becoming tumbleweed haunted ghost towns 3 months down the line, or the aforementioned meta cunts doing what they do best at full volume in my ear. But the thing is, Halo Reach sort of does stand up on its single player. It's not within spunking distance of classic territory, but there's nothing particularly offensive about it, and at least makes an effort. I was actually somewhat impressed by the game's ending, just because it's a neat little example of gameplay and story mixing. You hold out as long as you can against the Horde, but it's abundantly clear that it's only a matter of time before you have to take home the coveted first prize in the Who Can Have the Noblest Death competition. I guess whether Halo Reach is worth the price depends wholly on your level of disposable income. For example, if you have willingly parted with money for PlayStation Move, then feel free to go nuts, because apparently you already have done. Once upon a time, there was a game called Dead Rising that coined the phrase, when there's no more room in hell, the NPCs will walk into walls a whole bunch. It came out on the Xbox 360 while the console was still young and innocent, and the word Kinect would still have made red wavy lines appear in Microsoft Word, and featured a unique approach to sandbox gameplay set in a zombie holocaust. And while it's true the difficulty curve was so steep it had a fucking overhang, that only curved harder during the countless escort missions, hampered by survivor AI that had been curb-stomped a few times under the hobnail boots of the stupid fairy, it was at least a pretty original game. But now there's a sequel, so much for that. The only real difference is that instead of leveling up by taking funny pictures of zombies for your scrapbook, now you do it by sellotaping fire axes to sledgehammers and pounding them into gravy. Actually, that's a pretty good difference. So after everyone just sort of got over the whole zombie apocalypse thing in the first game, an effort is made to just live and let unlive with the zombies, or rather live and let splatter all over pay-per-view TV with chainsaw motorbikes. But there's another gosh darned outbreak, and our hero Chuck Green is trapped in a glitzy Vegas-style hellhole with a disproportionately large number of psychotic murderers with ridiculous amounts of health. The story is naturally retarded. This is Capcom we're talking about. Capcom make game stories the same way tumble dryers make potato salad. The main plot involves a protest group who are opposed to cruelty to zombies, because, you know, give a shambling corpse a friendly hug and he might briefly remember being human after he's had a few mouthfuls of your face, but the plot makes out they're supposed to be in the right. Chuck has even established to have sympathies with them right before he runs outside in a lady's crimpline dress and uses a battle axe to separate the top halves from the bottom halves of the entire cast of 28 Days Later. Let me make this clear now, I actually quite like Dead Rising 2, it just doesn't seem to like me very much. I'm not sure why, when I'm obviously such a cuddly, inoffensive soul. Just as before, you have a certain amount of time to kill before rescue, with timed events occurring at fixed points, and I had to restart the game at one point because the time limit on a critical boss encounter ran out while I was halfway through the fight.
fucking thing. How the hell did the boss make their escape while I was watching them wind my lower intestines around a candy floss machine, Dead Rising 2? The cynic in me, sorry, that should have read, the cynic that is me, wants to say that the ability to restart the game at any point retaining your character level and upgrades is a feature added so they wouldn't have to balance the game properly, as there are a lot of encounters and boss fights that on a first playthrough are about as fair as a man with nitroglycerin buttock injections entering an ass-kicking contest. It was only halfway through my second attempt that I finally learned the fucking dodge roll. That would have been nice about 3 hours ago when a giant pink chainsaw was sliding bloodily in and out of my newly created chest vagina. There's a fine line between extending a game's last ability and just wasting my fucking time. Importantly, the NPCs are significantly less retarded and will now efficiently follow you no matter how little attention you give them, sort of like most of my ex-girlfriends. They're much better at navigating crowds of zombies too, so the actual escorts are trivial skips through the tulips, but from a certain point onwards a surprising number of survivors refuse to follow you until you pay them money. Oh, okay, I'll just leave you inside that zombie's mouth for an hour or two while I go find an ATM. Sorry, survivor, I forgot. Did you say you wanted money or to be punched in the face with flaming boxing gloves? Because those I've got. It's not too much of a problem, because as long as you caveman club every ATM you pass, you'll never be hurting for money, but it does feel a bit hypocritical when one of the primary subsets of non-zombie enemies are looters, whereas what you're doing is just wealth redistribution, right? Speaking of flaming boxing gloves, the USP this time around is that objects can be combined into special weapons. The combinations that actually work, though, seem a little bit arbitrary, and experimentation is largely fruitless. The game will let you tape a machete to a broom handle, but not, say, a bowie knife or a meat cleaver or an angry cat. It all smacks of adventure game logic, with only the one thing the developer thought of being acknowledged, as in you can use the broom to knock the giant moustache off the Washington Monument, but not the bamboo stick, because you need that to appease the angry panda 6 rooms from now. Most of the combinations are maybe good for a quick giggle at the novelty, but there are only a handful of efficient day-to-day go-to combos. For example, once you do tape a fire axe to a sledgehammer, the game might as well just roll the credits, because anything that gets in the way of it will have a head resembling a Cornish pasty being hit by a car. I beat most of the boss fights just by wailing on them with it, tanking their attacks and necking orange juice like a dehydrated Floridian. The best part of playing Dead Rising 2 is when I decide to stop, but that's not the smug, wanky criticism it sounds like. After I save the game, I say, right, tomorrow I will reload that save, so everything I do now is consequence-free. Then I can run around experimenting, testing new combos, trying on women's dresses, and breaking wind into the phone every time my support character reminds me to find medication for my terminally ill child. Taking on the zombie hordes with a lawnmower blade strapped to the top of your head is exactly the kind of Serious Sam over-the-top fun violence action games need more of these days. What I like about it is that it's a true water cooler game, and I'm not talking about all that Facebook game bollocks where you can boast to all your friends because you stuck a radish up an imaginary cow's ass. You get together with your other Dead Rising 2 playing mates and you can discuss for hours what combos you found, boss fighting tactics, and where to find the chainsaws and mankinis. Perhaps a romance could blossom that will last a lifetime if you discover similar tastes in weapons and women's clothing, but what we don't want to know is what you'll do on the first date. I did some adding up once. To produce enough webs inside his body to fight crime on a regular basis, Spider-Man would need to eat the equivalent of 300 quarter pounder cheeseburgers a day. That'd be considered excessive for the London Philharmonic Orchestra, but it's futile to examine this sort of thing scientifically. Spider-Man comics were not like the Bible, in that neither have been known to let little things like science get in the way of their fun. Case in point, Spider-Man shattered dimensions. While foiling a museum robbery by some bloke who looks like he was dressed by the Liberace space program, Spider-Man accidentally shatters the magical tablets of MacGuffin, scattering its bits across 4 dimensions of time and space. Because of magic, I guess. See, this shit wouldn't fly with Batman. If any magic tablet tried to scatter itself across dimensions on his watch, he'd just will himself into existence and punch the writer until he promised to stop being such a twat. Shattered Dimensions plays like marketing material for Marvel Comics' range of alternate Spider-Man continuities. You see, every now and again, some writer at Marvel's creativity-fueled Dream Factory gets bored of repeatedly typing the words, Spider-Man punches the villain in the face, and transfers the characters to a different setting or time period so they can instead type, Spider-Man punches the villain in the face in space! The game alternates mission to mission between 4 continuities. The original Spider-Man, who must by now be the same age as Keith Richards, Ultimate Spider-Man, the teenage one whose every line of dialogue makes me want to wedgie him so hard his bollocks burst out the top of his head, Spider-Man 2099, the one in the future whose costume looks like someone attacked it with radioactive tomato ketchup, and Spider-Man Noir, a 1930s version who wants to be Batman so hard it burns inside his gritty vagina like a case of the spider clap. Now, even before I started playing it, this game sounded spread so thin that if it arrived on a sandwich, it would essentially be bread. But this was based on the assumption that the claim that each Spider-Man continuity features vastly different gameplay was actually true. How hopelessly naive of me. The two questionably named Spider-Mans, Amazing and Ultimate, as well as 2099, are basically identical sequences of punching lots of little things before moving on to punch a big thing, although Mr. 2099 can use bullet time and Mr. Ultimate can throw a hissy fit. Noir is the only universe with different core gameplay, being mostly stealth-based, and I know, Spider-Man, it was very cheeky of Batman Arkham Asylum to rip off all your major shticks, swinging from perch to perch, dangling baddies upside down from things. That was all you. Perhaps you were well within your rights to rip off Arkham Asylum, but you could have helped your case a lot more if you'd been as good. If you'd also ripped picked off the enemy AI that could actually outfox a piece of blue tack, rather than march cheerfully back to their patrol routes because they haven't been punched in the face by an intruder within the last 6 seconds. But even the noir sections aren't above descending into the occasional knuckle smorgasbord, and this is the problem I've always had with a lot of Spider-Man games. The very concept has this inbuilt unique game mechanic with the web-slinging thing, but it always just comes down to punching things. I appreciate that the average superhero only has barely enough mental capacity to break things and speak aloud every slightest thought that crosses their mind, but Spider-Man 2 had a strong web-slinging focus and it was fucking awesome, so do the arithmetic. While you can never accuse Shattered Dimensions of being monotone with its variety of colourful villains and settings, all you mostly do is fight the same three tiers of henchmen. Little ones who exist solely to be smacked around like one of those clacky ball executive toys, medium ones who have completed the chapter on blocking in the standard issue teach yourself martial arts book but not the one about avoiding being punched into the air and swung around like a kite made of stakes, and the big burly motherfuckers with poor English skills who inevitably wield giant mallets and have a serious weakness to being punched in the butt. Most admissions just end up being linear processions of rooms full of these lads, but on the occasions when it gets away from this formula, Shatty Dims has its quite entertaining moments. It certainly comes alive during the Deadpool chapter, where you're given more freedom to swing around, although Deadpool is voiced by Nolan North, who I'm sure is a perfectly nice man in real life, but every character he voices makes me want to pull off my thumbs. Which brings me to one of my major problems with Shattered Dimensions, that there's not a single character who can shut their fucking mouth for 5 seconds. When it comes to in-combat dialogue, stick to things like ow, or ooh-yah, or take that, if you really want to flex those writing muscles. I'm sure your mum thinks your stand-up set is solid gold, but even a line that won the International Totally 100% Hilarious Award from Jesus Christ is going to get old after it's been drooled out 15 times in the same fight. This tends to happen a lot in video games. I think game writing as a whole is in dire need of more discipline. Come to think of it, the entirety of Shitty Retentions could use a few nipple clams to calm it down. It flits restlessly and disconnectedly from encounter to encounter like an unmanned fire hose before, God forbid, any of the subplots can gain any depth or anything. It's fitting that Stan Lee does the narration, because the game as a whole reminds me of Stan Lee's public persona in that they both seem to be trying way too hard to be liked. It's the weird little fat boy who hangs around the cool kids, desperately changing outfits and mannerisms, hoping to finally be accepted, and who will probably get expelled for stealing girls' underpants while they're in the showers and sniffing them, and he didn't even know why he was doing it. He just saw it on an anime the previous night and thought people would think it was funny. But he'll always love you, that little fat boy, no matter how many spiders you make him eat. Are we friends now? He'll ask, thorax dripping from his chin. No, Shattered Dimensions, we will never be friends, because you're buggy and unfocused and you smell like old pants.
Normally I spend the first paragraph of these little tonsil exercise sessions leading into things with some rambling spiel of only borderline relevance, like maybe in this case wondering aloud if one could improve every Castlevania game by replacing Dracula with the Count from Sesame Street, although probably not Symphony of the Night because you'd have to rename Alucard to Tiertzimasse's Morph to Nuoketh. But this week, let's get straight to the meat of things, shall we? Castlevania Lords of Shadow contains a portal reference. That is literally all you need to know. It's attempting to jump on a bandwagon so late that the band has completed 3 sellout world tours and sold their wagon to a scrap dealer. It's not even a clever reference. A note found on a dead character ends with the words, "the cake is a lie." There's no contextual sense, it's just thrown in there like a random zombie wearing Groucho Marx glasses. The sort of thing you might do if you don't know what comedy is, but once looked it up in an old dictionary you found in a toilet. Might as well continue the review, although it hardly seems necessary now since the bar has already been set on the floor of Satan's wine cellar. Now, Castlevania shares an issue with the Sonic the Hedgehog franchise in that whenever it gets into bed with 3D, it always blows its load 30 seconds in and has to sleep on the wet patch. The Castlevania 2D stable can boast such stallions as Symphony of the Night and Aria of Sorrow, and what does the 3D stable have to offer? Castlevania 64? If you trotted that horse out at the auction, your highest bid would be 2 shotgun shells to the back of the head and a free ride to the glue shop. Still, if Resident Evil 4 taught me anything, it's that it's never too late to stop being shit, however briefly, so what the hey. You are Gabriel Belmont, a member of an order of holy knights tasked to rid the world of 3 Dark Lords so he can have his dead wife back before she starts to smell. And virtually everyone in the plot knows what a bad idea this is going to turn out to be, but once Gabriel sets his appallingly thick mind on something, he can't be shifted out of it without a decent-sized crowbar and a carpenter's mallet. Stop me if you've heard this one before. Beefy bloke with poor coping skills gets a big narc on after something kills his wife and takes it out on mythological creatures with a weapon on the end of a chain that can do light attacks and heavy attacks. But before I can bring down my well-used, like God of War butt stamp, like the terrible hammer of judgment that it is, the game dodges my swing and goes, wait, here's something original. Every now and again you have to have thrilling boss fights with monsters so big you have to ledge climb all over their bodies, pausing to hold on when they try to thrash you around like a little murderous nipple tassel, and chip away at their health by pecking at glowing weak spots. Say, I reply, another word for giant monster is Colossus, isn't it? I know what you're thinking, retorts Castlevania Lords of Shadow of the Colossus, but we're not like that game at all. That game had 16 colossi and we've got 3. That's a completely different number. So where do you want this like God of War butt stamp, I ask, after an embarrassed cough. On my face, please. So far, Castlevania Boards of Plywood is like a lot of things. It's like God of War, but also like Shadow of the Colossus, and it gets a bit Dante's Inferno-y at times, especially when Satan shows up looking like Marilyn Manson, coming out of the shower wearing a towel made of Vegemite. But the one thing it doesn't feel like is a Castlevania game. There's none of the free-roaming element that characterizes what some incredible genius termed Metroidvania, nor indeed is there any Dracula. I'd have thought the very first thing you do when starting out on a Castlevania game is write the word Dracula in the middle of a big
big piece of paper and work it out from there. He only shows up right at the very end in a way that seems to have been pulled right out of the story writer's biggest and sweatiest ass. Not that I'm demanding everything remain within the same formula forever, but if you're not going to have Dracula or free roaming, then calling the game Castlevania seems rather misleading when what you're actually making is God of War Germanic Mythology Edition. And it's not even a good imitation of God of War. It gets as far as the nice scenery, but it's racked with the usual issues a fixed camera brings. If a monster is outside your field of vision and about to attack, then your first warning is when your gizzards flutter prettily across the room. Coupled with the amateurish and sometimes confusing level design, the toughest fight in the game is with three standard enemies, because you have to do it in a broom cupboard while the camera is busy staring at the mantelpiece. Meanwhile, I beat every single non-Colossus boss fight by flicking quick attacks at them and dodge rolling away before they could react, like a packet of digestive biscuits on the deck of a lifeboat. You have two magic bars, light magic and dark magic. Blimey, there's a dichotomy rarely seen in video games. So whenever magic pickups are up for grabs, you have to press in the left or right thumbstick to decide what flavour you want, but the thumbstick buttons don't flow naturally into gameplay at the best of times, and in the middle of pitched battle, it's like stopping halfway through sex to wipe off the phlegm you just coughed onto your lover's forehead, and then your lover stabs you. The other thing is it's a fucking long game. It comes on two DVDs, so if you have any inclination to replay previous levels to find all the upgrades, the disc swapping will be gleefully kicking the back of your seat the whole way. It does have some actually rather cleverly designed puzzles, but practically apologises for it and gives the option to skip them. That's like providing the option to skip past all the paintings in the National Portrait Gallery so you can concentrate on staring at the floor. How about an option to skip your boring, repetitive, quick-time event-rattled boss fights, Castlevania Lords of Shadow? So basically, my first instinct was completely correct on this one. If a game has a portal reference, whatever purpose it serves, it tells you everything you need to know about the absolute wankers who had created control of the thing. If Portal had the comedic value of a perfectly timed fart, then portal references at this stage are a fart that has been going on for about 6 or 7 minutes, and now the stench in the room is causing bouts of spontaneous vomiting, and a strange blood-flecked liquid is dripping from the perpetrator's anus.
If you said to me, sci-fi reimagining of another culture's mythology mostly concerned with robots, I would immediately think, too human, and punch you in the bollocks for reminding me of it. But wait, there's a new sheriff in sci-fi reimagined mythology town, Enslaved, Odyssey to the West, a post-apocalyptic action adventure inspired by the classical Chinese epic called Journey to the West, in which the Monkey King is replaced by a sweaty white guy with neck muscles like mating dolphins. Hopefully this will keep us going until someone makes Space Pilot Jesus Christ versus Mecha Pontius, but don't delude yourselves, Enslaved isn't inspired by Journey to the West, is it? That is something I find considerably difficult to swallow, because the game takes liberties with the original story in the same way that Jason Voorhees takes liberties with cheerleaders. So while Journey to the West was about a mischievous and arrogant Monkey King forced to learn discipline by escorting a Buddhist monk on a pilgrimage, Enslaved is about a bloke slapping robots in the dick. But his name is Monkey, so that's alright then. After surviving a spaceship crash into post-apocalyptic New York in the middle of the Robot Monster Beauty Contest, Monkey wakes up to find a skinny teenage girl named Tripitaka has accessorized him with the magical headband of clinginess that will blow his head off if she dies or he runs away. The exact definition of running away being quite open to interpretation. Once or twice, the flaky bitch popped my seal of freshness because I moved more than 30 yards away while hunting for secret tokens. Perhaps Tripitaka is still reeling from the shock of having grown a vagina since the original text. Basically, the only bits of Enslaved that are inspired by the story are the character names, some of Monkey's weapons, and the headband thing. It's like renaming Master Chief to Elizabeth and arguing that Halo was inspired by Pride and Prejudice. So let's just put that whole Journey to the West thing out of our minds, because after a while the developers certainly did. Assume that it's an original story, although admittedly in today's games industry that may be even harder to swallow, but anyway, with that in mind, every character in the game needs to sit down with a cup of tea and figure out what their personalities are. Tripitaka, are you a vulnerable flower or a sassy action girl, on top of not being a monk? Could you decide whether you have the upper body strength to pull yourself onto a ledge, or whether you're going to dangle there screaming for help before falling off onto a mine and making me start the damn section again? And Monkey, are you a feral amoral beast or a puts-upon cynical everyman, and if the latter, why did we even need the bloody slave headband, when you just blithely agree to do whatever Tripitaka wants to do? There are times, and one scene in particular, when I get the extremely strong impression that Monkey secretly gets off on being dominated. That and slapping robots in the dick. That becomes clear when you get a slow motion close-up for killing the last robot in the room and Monkey's got this look on his face like he's getting sucked off in a wind tunnel. Besides mechanical dick slapping, there's a slightly uncharted-y ledge climbing aspect, although the environment art is so cluttered all the ledges have to glow like you're following the trail of the radioactive mountain goat. But the platforming is linear to the point of being prohibitive. The game is like a fussy parent hiding behind the bushes while you go trick-or-treating and won't even let you jump unless you're pointing directly at the next ledge. This got very silly at one point when Monkey tottered fearfully on the edge of a 3-foot-high box because he wasn't at the one specific place where he was permitted to drop onto the ground. And on several occasions while platforming, the next ledge wasn't immediately obvious, so I just pointed the analog stick in various random directions and mashed the jump button. When you have a gameplay mechanic that can be outwitted by rubbing the controller on a dog's ass, it might be worth going back to formula, because there's no challenge to this. This is not platforming, this is just walking down a very unusually shaped corridor. There are some puzzles as well, in that occasionally there are levers with big floating arrows over them saying, pull this, retard, which open up the next bit of corridor. Ah, the Quake 2 school of puzzle design. But why am I still talking about puzzles and platforming? What am I, some kind of
of 6 foot ovary. Let's talk about the combat. Yeah, that's what us penis owners like, and not unlike my penis, the combat's kind of a mess, and a lot less difficult than the game thinks it is. Most of the time you can just wail on the robots, occasionally dodging or using a charge attack if you're feeling fancy, but the sweep attack is useless and the block is useless, except for one single enemy who stun locks you with a fast combo like the cheap little bitch it is. And if you thought Tripitaka was clingy, then she's a butterfingered ice queen compared to the camera, which hovers lovingly behind Monkey's glistening back muscles during combat, when zooming further out would have made for much cleaner visuals and less chance of getting a claw in the ear hole from some off-screen troublemaker. Sometimes the game gives you the opportunity to stealth your way around some robots on smoke break, but really it's just quicker to get caught and slap them into Tamagotchis, plus you get more experience. Speaking of which, the upgrades are poorly balanced. You can get a health regeneration upgrade really early on, making things even more trivial and banishing health pickups to the increasingly crowded bin of useless. So, the gameplay design is pretty undisciplined. You can beat a lot of the game by taping the controller to a drum kit during the solo at the beginning of Hot for Teacher, and a lot of the in-game animations look like someone went through and randomly removed half the frames, but while their personalities waver, the characters have quite a good chemistry and some appealing dialogue that makes them hard to dislike, even if the tone at a couple of moments lurchingly shifts to webcomic style between goofing about and angsty drama, an issue it shares with the developer's last game, Heavenly Sword. My main problem with the story is it's hard to stay invested when the main plot is based around the pursuit of revenge against an antagonist that we haven't actually seen. The robots display no controlling intelligence and could just be wrecking shit up for robo giggles. This does sort of get explained in the ending, but it goes for a slightly retarded twist that doesn't really gel with anything up to that point. Without wishing to spoil, turns out the big baddie is just misunderstood, and I suppose his giant laser death scorpions have just been trying to hand me an apology card and a fruit basket.
As if it weren't clear enough already from it being on the same engine, with the same controls, and having the same thing where all the female characters look like a more boyish Natalie Portman, New Vegas is functionally just an expansion pack of Fallout 3, and I said everything I needed to say about Fallout 3 in my Fallout 3 review of Fallout 3. There is one interesting new feature though, Hardcore Mode, which adds the need to regularly eat, sleep, and drink while travelling, which sounded like fun in a Bear Grylls-y kind of way, and this is a role-playing game, so let's motherfucking roleplay! Woke up in a doctor's office with some guy telling me I've been shot in the head and may have suffered brain damage, but I've learned not to trust the opinion of giant mustachioed spider people, so I made my excuses and left. The town I found myself in was pleasant enough, with all kinds of useful supplies that residents were just giving away, that is to say, not supervising, but everyone seemed to think I wanted to go in pursuit of the bloke who shot my brain. But I'd have thought the fact that he shot me in the brain was a fucking good reason to not pursue the guy. I keep hearing about this New Vegas place that sounds like a happening kind of town, daddy-o, and the most direct route is north, so after loading myself down with other people's packed lunches, I set off on the north road with a song in my heart and was immediately eaten by giant killer flies, starting to feel like I might not be the master of my own destiny. Fine, whatever. After reloading, reincarnating, I went south instead, and thankfully no cosmic anvils descended from on high. After a peaceful walk through the lovely countryside, I began to feel thirsty, so I drank some pilfered soda bottles that boasted a plus H2O effect and was about to set off again when I suddenly became dehydrated. While double-checking that I wasn't wearing fucking Arctic gear, I noticed that my bottles of purified water had a minus H2O effect. Oh, I see, the H2O stat refers to how much water you need, not how much you have. Well, that's fucking confusing. When does a plus sign ever indicate a negative effect? Wait a second, drinking soda makes me more thirsty. How does that make any fucking sense? Is it made of seawater? Anyway, the sun was hanging low in the sky like the carrot being dangled from the fishing rod of destiny, and I needed somewhere to sleep. Fortunately, I stumbled upon a repurposed prison populated by the gang whose members had been randomly attacking me all day, but I didn't bear a grudge because they'd all learned combat from watching their hamsters play fighting and died easier than the fucking flies. They wouldn't let me in until I paid 100 caps though. I'm pretty sure Disneyland doesn't charge that much, so I turned away and moved on. Then I stood on a mine and my legs blew off. Perspective thus gained, I sheepishly dragged myself back to prison and gave them all my money. But then the prison doctor wanted another 75 quid to glue my legs back on. But just as fate had lodged its spiked butt plug as far as it could go, the kindly prison storekeeper was nice enough to just give away 200 caps out of a strongbox in a locked room behind several armed guards. So with a net profit and two shiny new legs fresh from the wrapper, I settled down that night on a prison mattress that smelled like it had seen its fair share of brutal romantic conquests. As I stole breakfast, I was beginning to sense some hostility from these murderers. I decided there and then that I had to stop stealing things. While there didn't seem to be any negative consequences for having low karma, it was sucking all the survivalist fun out of the game. I mean, my life. I set off in a southeasterly direction and was attacked by bandits, who I could now kill from a smug position of moral superiority. Then I took all their stuff, which isn't stealing because they attacked me, making it mine by international law of go fuck yourselves. I'd been using a pistol and rifle and found myself relying less on the VATS aiming system because I don't want to have to go to make a cup of tea every time I pull the trigger. But when manually aiming, my pistol seemed more accurate than my rifle because the rifle sights look like I'm aiming down a fucking brick. I reached the next settlement on the road to find it taken over by Roman legionaries, but they seem like quite friendly chaps who just want me to admire their modern art project, which unfortunately involved nailing everyone who could have sold me supplies or a bed for the night to bits of wood. So after letting one of their dogs bite my arm off, I hiked northeast to the next settlement where I found a doctor for my arm and a kindly old couple who let me drink out of their toilet. morning got off to a flying start when I blundered into a hostage situation at the next town between local law enforcement and some gang who had taken two of their members hostage. I managed to convince the leader of the soldiers to let me try negotiating, but really I only wanted to loot the abandoned buildings for water and breakfast cereal. I felt bad on my way out though, so I shot one of the gang members in the head and ran behind the soldiers as the battle broke out. Tee hee. But then the soldiers massacred the gang with no difficulty. You lazy motherfuckers, what did you need me for? They didn't even shoot the hostages, the pussies. I didn't realize the gangs were hiring from Girl Scout troops. Anyway, I was now within groping distance of my destination, and I strolled confidently up to the magnificent steel barricade of New Vegas. Then I had to stroll confidently all the way around the fucking thing, looking for the entrance. Eventually that got sorted out, and I found myself in a delightful little suburb on the way into New Vegas proper, which security wouldn't let me into because I didn't have 2,000 caps on me, which I estimated was slightly more money than there existed in the world. But I'd come too far to pull out and soil the bedspread now, so nearby I found a bar willing to employ me to collect some debts from some locals, and then I just kept all the money for myself. Ha! Stupid trusting jerks. And then I made it. I stepped out into the glittering lights of the city, the towering buildings, noisy monoliths, to the sheer potential of why the fuck can't I move? The game froze up. I mean, my life froze up. I mean, all that radioactive toilet water must have given me some kind of paralyzing... Oh, bollocks to this. Role-playing in Fallout 3 is difficult enough with the interface and the terrifying fixed eye contact conversations without it bugging out as well. And it'll take more than having to stop for a sandwich and a piss every now and again to make Fallout 3 more immersive. Maybe if you ground it into powder and dissolved it in a swimming pool, but it'll probably only turn the water brown. You've got to feel sorry for Star Wars fans in this day and age, when you're not mocking them or kicking them down flights of stairs, I mean. They haven't exactly rolled a double six in the great game of life to begin with, and now the one thing that has made their existence marginally less wretched is crumbling before their very eyes like old pastry in a dishwasher. Between movies, games, books, and tea towels, the shit of Star Wars now vastly outweighs the good, which consists of the first two movies and arguably Knights of the Old Republic. Not that they'll ever admit that. It's quite entertaining to watch the level of denial die-hard Star Wars fans operate on as they try to convince you that the romance in Attack of the Clones was totally believable. To say Hayden Christensen and Natalie Portman had chemistry in that film is like saying that a chair stacked on another chair is a sizzlingly erotic love scene. So I look forward to seeing how the fanboys justify The Force Unleashed 2, because it is the most grossly offensive and mishandled application of intellectual property. So we slip back into the Cuban heels of Starkiller, the most hideously overpowered thing in the Star Wars universe, until they figure out how to glue three Death Stars together, Darth Vader's secret apprentice, and after turning against the Empire and getting himself killed in the last game, spoiler alert, Darth Vader has decided that the best course of action would be to clone another one, who hopefully can be persuaded out of his rebellious attitude with rigorous abuse. See, this is the kind of thinking that makes the Empire the formidable universe-spanning power that can be brought down by college kids and their pet gophers. Kel Caprese, Starkiller 2.0, remembers who he is and kills his way out of the Empire facility to reunite with the Rebel Alliance. Now, Luke Skywalker could have whined for his country and his dad went at it like there was a vice permanently attached to his bollocks, but Starkiller wears an emo fringe that reaches to his knees. All he cares about is getting back together with his love interest. And forgive me if I'm unsympathetic, but if Christensen and Portman had a chemistry like two chairs stacked together, then Starkiller and What's-Her-Face were like a picture of two chairs stacked together, crudely drawn on butcher paper with a bit of partially dried poo. So, here are all the ways you can kill people in this game, like a bullied teenager with a semi-automatic and an Oedipus complex. You can hit them with a lightsaber if you're some kind of watercress-eating spod with no imagination. You can reflect their blaster shots back at them. You can throw your lightsaber at them. You can microwave them with force lightning. You can force push them into walls. You can lift them off their feet and throw them at their mates. You can lift them up, microwave them, throw your lightsaber at them, then throw whatever mess remains at their mates. And you can Jedi mind trick them into fighting each other or hurling themselves off bridges, which is incidentally hilarious. And yet, none of the enemies seem the least bit afraid of you. It's like they all went to the wrong briefing by mistake. Somewhere in the universe, a platoon of terrified SWAT officers with riot shields and machine guns are facing off against a single confused Ewok. You might think this all sounds kind of fun in a slightly psychotic way, and it is, but the game handles its fun elements like a gazelle handles the fine china. Starkiller is so stupidly overpowered that individual enemies and even small groups are barely worth registering, just fling a coffee table vaguely in their direction and let them all die of banged shins. There are special stronger varieties of trooper, but I think there must have been some falling out among the combat designers. Perhaps some off-colour comparison was drawn between someone's girlfriend and Emperor Palpatine, and they wouldn't speak to each other long enough to realise the force lightning in one form or another is the one weakness of virtually every otherwise invulnerable enemy in the game. The combat does get fun when you have to divide your attention between larger groups, mind-tricking an elite trooper with one hand and force-pushing a lamppost up someone's butthole with the other, but the game doesn't often have the balls to throw enough simultaneous enemies at you to make it a really meaty challenge, and more often than not descends into repetitive one-on-ones with a giant robot or one of his three or four slightly different mates. Gameplay pro tip: keep your distance and deflect its missiles back at it. Which enemy is that a pro tip for, Yahtzee? Throw a fucking rock. That's also a good tactic. The philosophy of The Force Unleashed 2 is that if something's worth doing, it's worth doing 15 fucking times. It's padded to the point that insults our intelligence, like a schoolgirl showing up one day with two honeydews jammed down her shirt. I mean, come on, Hortense, no one blooms that fast. The game has a total of four locations. The last mission is a revisit of the first one. One of them exists only for a cutscene, in which Yoda shows up for 3/4 of a second so they could stick his wrinkly Muppet ass on the back of the box and make fanboys cream their C-3PO pants and pajama bottoms. The rest are sequences of shamelessly copy-pasted rooms broken up by boss fights. Listen, developers, if we've shown we've figured figured out the correct attack sequence for your little boss, don't make us do it 5 times. Twice will do, because the first one might have been a fluke, but beyond that, it's a game, not an aptitude test for the operation of heavy machinery. The very worst part is the final fight with Darth Vader. I'm not sure he even attacks you. Mostly he just blocks half your attacks and loses about 1 nano inch of health to the rest. It's like taking down a 30-foot brick wall with a toffee hammer. He does spawn clones to attack you, but they've all got brittle bone disease and give you free health when they die. Not sound tactics, Vader, me old mate. The only real threats are dying of old age or falling off the platform, and on that subject, Force Unleashed 2, does falling down an abyss kill us or teleport us back onto the ledge Zelda style? Because you need to decide. Don't just switch from one to the other whenever the woodpecker on your head penetrates your skull. So the gameplay time is artificially padded, but here's the punchline. It's still too short. I didn't even think that was possible. It's like they were working on DLC for Force Unleashed 1 and then thought, you know what, fuck it. If they paid full price for that Clone Wars movie, they'll pay full price for this. I'm actually insulted, and I'm not even a fan of this stupid franchise. If I was, I'd already be measuring myself for the noose. But here's a nice quote for your box art. Force Unleashed 2 could almost have been written by George Lucas himself, because what George Lucas does is not so much writing as it is vomiting through a pen. Could somebody please invade America? I know it's not exactly prime real estate and can just about produce corn and shitty TV, but someone really needs to help them blow off some steam. It's hard not to look at all these war games about Russia invading America and not be reminded of fan fiction. America is a fat teenage virgin lying on her front on her bed, staring up at her Edward and Bella poster while crossing and uncrossing her ankles and dreamily writing creepy stories about having filthy monkey sex with the quiet Eastern European boy down the road. And the child psychologist hired by her concerned parents gives the following advice. What this girl needs is a good hard dicking. So come on, Russia, take the hint. World War III, let's do it. Yeah, lots of people will die, but it's not like the human race couldn't use a bit of a pruning now and then. What about you, China? You've got loads of people to spare, you selfish bastards. I say, ram a few of them up America's rancid hairy fun hole, and maybe she can remember how to act like a grown-up and come like a howler monkey. Anyway, here's America's latest virginal howler monkey sex fantasy. Call of Duty Black Ops, another opportunity for the Call of Duty franchise to wave military hardware in our faces and go, foray! This time with a bit of a heavy Manchurian candidate influence, but don't worry, it's not so heavy that it gets in the way of all the shooting foreigners. You mostly play Aryan Superman Alex Mason, not to be confused with Alec Mason. Mason, the protagonist of Red Faction Guerrilla. Are there so few white Anglo-Saxon tough guy hero names in the world that you have to start recycling? I'm going to give loads off the top of my head. Gabriel Stone, Dirk Action, John Fist. Anyway, Blake Shrapnel has been strapped to a chair and is being tortured for information by shadowy figures who want to know the truth behind a string of mysterious numbers that, like the Inspector Gadget theme tune, he just can't get out of his head. This sends him into various flashbacks of past missions to form a framing device for the action. Events rattle undisciplined back and forth through time, from the Bay of Pigs invasion to the Vietnam War to an interview with JFK being played by someone doing an absurd comedy JFK impression, and there are many moments when I just want to yell time out and demand someone explain what the fuck's going on before another thing explodes. Because the thing about all the Call of Duty games I've played lately is that they all seem to be hooked up to IV drips full of pop rocks. Black Ops just can't calm the fuck down. If 5 seconds ever pass without a gunshot or an explosion, then it's probably because you just passed out from an epileptic fit. The game's like a nagging spouse slapping you around the back of the head every 5 seconds. Go there, keep running, take cover, not there, you're getting shot, there, shoot that guy, not him, he's on your side, can't you tell he's wearing a slightly different hat? Quick, pick up that grenade and throw it back, I don't know, over there somewhere, oh, there. See, if you'd thrown it sooner, that wouldn't have happened, you stupid cunt. You only get a break on the loading screens, which will generally helpfully remind you that grenades explode and you should probably avoid getting exploded in future. I know the sorts of attention spans you're working with can't stick with a 15-second shampoo advert unless you flash some titties halfway through, Treyarch, but there is such a thing as juxtaposition. If the action never lets up, we've got no point of comparison and it's too overwhelming to focus on. I played through a lot of this game in a trance. Writing this review, I had to think really hard to recall where the first mission took place, and I only know it was Cuba because I remembered Fidel Castro showing up twirling his moustache like Snidely Whiplash. So what does the term Black Ops evoke in your mind? Espionage, darkened meetings in smoky car parks, exchanging a package with another spy in a public place by awkwardly pretending to make out, and most importantly, deniability. It occurs to me that the American government would have considerable difficulty denying the kinds of things that go on in Black Ops. What's that, Vladimir? No, no, that fleet of American aircraft carriers were just in that particular bit of ocean for a volleyball tournament and to take some photos for a Navy recruitment booklet. No, I can't imagine how one of your battleships in the exact same area could have gotten riddled with bullets. Although now I come to think about it, I do remember hearing what could have been minigun fire, but at the time I thought it was just someone playing squash very, very enthusiastically. It's disappointing because the title led me to expect a bit of sneaky snake stealth gameplay to break up the testosterone overload, but the only thing black about these ops are the spent shell casings. Modern Warfare 1 had more stealth than this, and I remind you, that was the game where a nuke goes off in your face. Now that's what I call juxtaposition. Well, since we're looking for something different, I guess I should mention that the game comes with a zombie minigame, because after Call of Duty World at War and the upcoming Red Dead Redemption DLC, apparently everything now has to be moving towards some kind of zombie singularity by law. You fight off waves of the undead, barricading their entry points and opening up more of the map. map while the game constantly nags you to turn on the power without thinking to give any hint on how exactly one does such a thing, but I've got to admit, it's kind of fun. Play with a friend, then get them to tell you when zombies are breaking in 2 rooms away because there's no other fucking way to tell. See, I can give constructive criticism. Also, why aren't the zombies wearing party hats? But getting back to what I hesitatingly call the serious aspect of Black Ops, it's not just disorientating, it's a bit disquieting too. Why is my character putting broken glass into the mouth of a helpless prisoner? I don't think he'd find that very tasty. Yo, bugger my britches, that was uncalled for. Who are the good guys in this game again? The weird thing is, the character then joins your party after he's done spitting out blood and bits of mouth. That's one working relationship that's off to an awkward start. Tellingly, the game features the Vietnam War and the Bay of Pigs invasion, both for the longest time avoided by video games because the United States went into them for slightly cunty, unheroic reasons. But I guess Black Ops means we've stopped giving a shit. I guess we're hankering for another decent war so much that we no longer care whether we're the good guys or not. So that's why I say let's just do it. Don't need a reason, just ring up Eastern Europe and say maybe we could do the genocide thing this time. Then everyone can line up in the Sahara Desert with their latest weapons tech and all just get it out of their system. Perhaps Switzerland could be persuaded to blow the starting whistle. You find me, listeners, in a slightly melancholic mood. See, I was going through Sonic Colors this week because it actually left a good first impression by opening with gameplay rather than tortured cutscene bullshit. But then after 2 levels, the game went, aha, you fell into my trap. Tortured cutscene bullshit away. Afterwards, I felt angry and ashamed of myself for falling for it yet again. Sega plonks Sonic the Hedgehog on the front of something and swindles another $80 of the escapist's money. For shame. So much of AAA gaming these days is endless sequels, rip-offs, and wank. I'm beginning to wonder if looking for quality and innovation in mainstream console gaming, an industry where no game escapes the Heath Robinson machine of marketing and committee design with its bumhole unsullied, and where companies still insist on producing gimmicky motion-controlled fatted calves to stroke the fleeting indecisive erections of casual gamer prodigal sons, is like looking for the last unscabby patch on the vagina of the village whore. Perhaps I just need a break, or at least another week to play Assassin's Creed Brotherhood, so before we get too far into the Christmas period, I thought I'd devote a video to a sphere of gaming where interesting things are happening. iPhone games aren't exactly cinematic, but I've definitely played more of them than mainstream console games lately, generally while waiting for mainstream console games to fucking load. It amazes me how much variety there is in the iPhone game top 25. Ordinarily, if number 1 was Angry Birds, I'd expect numbers 2 to 25 to all be stuff like Furious Mammals or Perturbed Marsupials or Incensed Lamellibranches in the noble name of the opportunistic buck, but no, it honestly seems to be the only market driven by actual gameplay innovation, where the next big seller is almost impossible to predict, which is why I'm loath to dismiss it as a casual gaming platform, although there is no shortage of that. It seems to be a great place for small developers without the resources to render Marcus Fenix's left nipple to get innovative ideas out there and earning money, as long as they don't mind taking it up the arse from Apple. But hey, if developing for iPhone means taking a cock up the arse, then developing for, say, the Wii means taking a fucking humpback whale. So let's start with the aforementioned Angry Birds by Rovio Mobile. The game is set in a cartoon world after some apocalyptic pandemic of leprosy has robbed everything of limbs. A community of limbless pigs have stolen the eggs from a community of limbless birds, perhaps believing them to contain the much sought after secret of cement. You see, the pigs all live in houses made from unconnected blocks and bits of wood that can be knocked over by looking at them too hard, or more practically, by launching wingless birds at them bodily with a catapult. It's quite fun in a jumping on the sandcastle your brother spent hours on and laughing as the tears roll down his stupid fat face kind of way, but the one thing I've never figured out is the scoring system. On some levels I can use just one bird to destroy all the piggies, tear down the building and erect a monument in memory of my fallen comrades with the debris, and the game still only gives me 1 star. What the fuck do I have to do to impress you, Angry Birds? I tried playing with my head in a bucket of spiders and they just spun webs in my mouth. Next up, Cut the Rope by Zeptolab, an example of the genre uninformatively termed physics puzzlers. The simplest idea is the best, and you can't get simpler than a game whose title is also its instruction manual. There is a big sweetie dangling from a rope and the objective is to navigate that sweetie into the mouth of a small lizard by increasingly roundabout routes, but a rope will certainly have to be cut at some point. I much prefer this star rating system to Angry Birds. Each level contains 3 stars, and if you collect them all, you get 3 stars, so that's much more quantifiable. But either it's a tad on the easy side, or I'm the god king of space, because I got all the stars on every level within 1 hour of play, so some more level packs that explore the flinging physics a bit more would be nice. My other objection is that the little lizard thing is the most entitled little shit in gaming since Ashley from Resident Evil 4, and at least she had a rack on her. He just sits there on his fat little ass with his mouth hanging open, expecting his divine majesty's breakfast to just drop in like a Half-Life barnacle without the charm. How about an alternative gameplay mode that replaces the sweetie with a breeze block? Completing the iPhone game chart top 3 at time of writing is Fruit Ninja by Halfbrick Studios. This is about as simple as games get. There isn't even the paltriest context for what you're doing. You're not exacting revenge on limbless pigs or feeding your pet bitch lizard. You're a ninja, fruit is flying up in front of you, and fuck fruit, sitting around all smug on trees and in pies. There are gameplay modes that add bombs and power-ups if you really need them, but the mere mere act of cutting up flying mangoes and pineapples has this almost zen-like appeal in a popping bubble wrap kind of way. The fruit gets cut up with visceral sprays of juice and satisfying squelches like a velvet fist withdrawing noisily from a moist... Hey, wait a minute. Halfbrick are based in Brisbane, the same city where I live. I, with my well-documented close ties to the local games industry. Yahtzee, are you using your privileged position to big up your mates again, you nepotistic shit? Let me assure you that historically being my mate has been no guarantee of safe critical passage. Don't forget my other friend who worked on the chariot racing sequences in Prince of Persia Two Thrones. He certainly hasn't. And finally, there's Doodle God by a company who apparently unironically call themselves Joy Bits. You combine elements together to create other elements, and that's pretty much it. It's a popular title, but frankly, I don't see the appeal. Hardly seems like a game at all, just the most frustrating aspect of point-and-click adventure games taken out and put in a big annoying spotlight that keeps calling you thick. It starts off alright when you don't have many elements. Fire and earth equals lava, lava and air equals rock. Fine, little bit roundabout, but never mind. But then after a certain point, you have so many elements, the combinations that actually do anything are so rare and obtuse that all you can do is wait for the hints to come up. Fish plus knowledge equals octopus? That's not logic, that's fucking batshit on a sandwich. And I'm a little disappointed that cat plus internet doesn't create YouTube. Anyway, that concludes this scratching of the surface of iPhone games, which are well worth getting into. You do need an iPhone, of course, but if you don't have one at this point, then please let us know how you found a way to breathe on Mars. Forgive me, Father, for I have sinned. It has been never since my last confession. See, I don't like multiplayer. If my daughter brought a multiplayer game home, I'd whip it with a riding crop, but so help me, I played the Assassin's Creed Brotherhood multiplayer. Not only that, but I unironically thought it was quite good. The main problem I always have with multiplayer is that human beings are grabby, entitled, selfish, ugly, stupid, evil cockstoppers, but Ascree Bro cleverly embraces these qualities, with every player under orders to ruin someone else's day. You wander about in crowds, clutching a single bitterly crumpled photograph of your target, spotting them, following them into a dark alley, and bidding how do you do with an extendo blade skull fuck. It's almost exactly like my last high school reunion. You can't dead leg me now, can you, Lee Drummond? As a stealth game enthusiast, it's just all kinds of fun to stand by a market stall pretending to be an NPC, watching your target walk slowly down the street towards you, also pretending to be an NPC, picking your moment to break off and jab in between the ribs. Ha! You got out NPC'd, son! What's that, Father? No, I guess I won't keep playing it. That's the other thing I hate about multiplayer. I don't want to play the same game over and over again. I get enough dull routine in my sex life. Also, if the player's hunting you are any good, then whether you bump into them or your target first is pretty much a crap shoot, depending on who randomly spawned closest to who. Yes, Father, I suppose it barely counts as multiplayer at all when the only social interaction available is a knife in the eye, and it's more like some kind of survival challenge mode where other people use each other in place of AI opponents. And I still firmly believe that while a multiplayer-focused game selling for under $30 or as DLC is fine, any game with the balls to charge the same price as 9 back alley blowjobs had better not show its face at my door without a decent single-player campaign in one hand and a bottle of wine in the other. So no, I guess I'm not being hypocritical at all. Thank you, Father, this has been a great comfort. It's a shame you're my current target. Stab. What surprises me about Assassin's Creed Divine Secrets of the IR Sisterhood is that it is actually a sequel. I assumed it was going to be some kind of optional add-on story for Ascree 2 in the mold of Final Fantasy X2, but with hopefully less... well, less Final Fantasy X2, but it's actually a significant installment of the ongoing Ascree canon, except Ascree 2's plot was all about 15th century assassin Ezio Auditore AD whatever it was, while future Desmond, the blandest human being since Blandy McGee's tax accountant, sat around eating pies, and in Ascree Bro, it's Ezio's turn to faff about for 10 hours while Desmond gets the significant plot updates. I'm willing to bet this was some planned conclusion to Desmond's story that somehow got cut from Assassin's Creed 2, and which Ubisoft have now cheekily stretched out into a full game. That's fairly obvious, because gameplay-wise, Assassin's Creed Brotherhood is pretty much just Assassin's Creed 2.5. Oh, no, more faffing about. Ezio, being Italian and therefore shiftless and work-shy, forgets that he's literally an assassin and fails to kill Rodrigo Borgia, whose family promptly blow up Ezio's villa. Thank fuck for that, said I. At least now there'll be no more of that stupid city renovation side quest, or so I thought. No more city renovation, says Ascree Brotherhood. Oh, sorry, I thought you said lots more city renovation. Ezio moves to Rome to plan the attack against the Borgias while setting up his very own home assassination business with Niccolo Machiavelli, and passes the time by buying up the entirety of Rome one shop at a time. Not sure what the thinking is here, Ezio. Yo, me old mate, are you planning to assassinate the Borgias or just evict them? As before, the only purpose for a lot of this is to increase your regular income, but it's also pretty much the only thing you can spend that income on, creating this nightmarish tidal wave of money that only grows the more you try to get rid of it. Meanwhile, future Desmond and his future Scooby gang of attractive college students are traipsing around future Italy, searching Ezio's memories for the location of the recurring MacGuffin they think will solve all their problems. And I won't spoil the ending, but let's just say that it certainly does that. At first, Brotherhood is basically just more of Ascree 2 with only one city and a rockin' beard, but after a fairly ungainly amount of time into the game, the one major new gameplay mechanic gets introduced. Ezio gets to take the Pied Piper role and picks up disaffected youth off the street to enroll them in his little assassin kindergarten. I consider it no coincidence that the maximum number of recruits you can have is the same as a football team plus one substitute, because the assassin mentoring minigame has a bit of a championship manager feel to it. You send your little mini-me's off to complete assassination and espionage missions around Europe, which sounds interesting, but it all takes place through text-based menus, and it's about as involving as filling out an application form for a provisional murder license. The benefits for doing all this are threefold. More fucking goddamn and buy the Jesus money, levelling up your little tykes so that one day you can tearfully watch their graduation ceremony. And if you've got a few recruits knocking around spare while you're out in the field, you can sick them on a target for an easy kill. But why should someone else have all my fun? What happened to you, Ezio? You sold out. It used to be about the killing. To summarise my review of it, Assassin's Creed 2 was a good game if a bit too easy and loaded with unnecessary shit. Lo and behold, Assassin's Creed Bro is all of that too. Now frankly groaning under the additional unnecessary shit, and even easier now that you can literally get someone else to do the work for you. Under all that, it's still got enough of the good, but it's the same good, and was it really worth putting a whole new game out when they could have just released the multiplayer as DLC and not deprived me of a 9 blowjob spectacular? My understanding was that Assassin's Creed as a series was about exploring various historical settings with future Desmond as a framing device, but as much as I like Ezio, my concern after two games is that we're getting bogged down with our spaghetti scoffing friend. I hate to say it, but maybe it's time for the inevitable game entirely about future Desmond. He's still got the personality of a damn fish, which might explain what his fish-lipped girlfriend sees in him, but the other characters in the Scooby Gang are actually quite appealing, especially the snarky, sarcastic, misanthropic British man. He really rubs me up the right way. Can't think why. Isn't being an adult great? You can go on all the fairground rides, drink yourself to death, and put your dick in all kinds of magical things. Sometimes I like going to hospitals for terminally ill children and just rubbing it in. Wow, you guys really suck at arm wrestling. Anyone catch the new R18 rated film? I have, it's not that great. Hey, you know what would be funny? If the Make-A-Wish Foundation came around and you asked to be sexually initiated by a large creepy man, that'd throw them a curveball, wouldn't it, the smug philanthropic cunts? But the tragedy of being an adult is that once you can do everything denied to you as a child, you're smart enough to not want to anymore. There's one glorious moment when you first gain independence and realize nothing stopping you from eating jelly every meal of every day, and then after a few difficult shits, you never want to clap eyes on the stuff again, and your emotional maturation is complete. And that's Splatterhouse in a nutshell, a childish jelly binge followed by tedium and diarrhea. Splatterhouse is a remake or reimagining, or whatever your preferred name is for desperate milking of any cow with the slightest brand recognition, no matter how skinny and choleric. It's one of those for the classic Splatterhouse 2D brawler series from the unforgiving arcade days, when games were designed to snatch more children's pocket money than Lee Drummond. The thing is, as classic as it was, Splatterhouse was never particularly good. It was a slow, single attack button side-scroller made remarkable only by its grisly visual design reminiscent of the inside of a Cornish pasty, which won the publicity lottery when it sparked some kind of inevitable moral controversy. But in today's enlightened, joyous post-Michael Atkinson days, a violent game trying to sell itself with gore comes across as hopelessly quaint, even a little bit backward. It's like a gay fellow standing on a desk and shouting, "I'm out and I'm proud, and if you're offended, then you can just deal with it all the way back to Straitsville, Charlie," in the lobby of his local YMCA. But there is something to be said for a game whose stated goal is to wallow in wretched, gushing excess. Splatterhouse certainly seems to have that ambition. Copious blood, limbs flying off like graduation caps, and there are even collectible pictures of big, juicy, naked tits just for the sake of covering all the hedonistic bases. But once you're mentally tuned into the Caligula mindset, the gore swiftly starts to feel repetitive and unsatisfying. One of the posters I saw for this game bore the tagline, "He'll rip your head off." This is at least accurate, but it would be even more so if it were followed by the words, "And that's all he'll fucking do." In classic Wad of Gore fashion, you can grab weakened enemies to do finishing moves, and most of them just involve pulling off the closest thing it has to a head. How about a little creativity, my man? That one fellow you killed by shoving your hand up his ass and pulling his rectum out was original, or at least it was before you did it 50 fucking times. And in some cases, the in-game animations are so choppy and the monsters are such messy piles of cartilage that I'm not even sure if what I'm ripping off was attached to them in the first place. I could just be undoing their bow ties for all I know. The goriest bit in the game is right at the beginning when your human self's intestines plop out, and even that left me wondering who'd spilt all that unrealistic looking cranberry juice all over the place. In-game combat is your standard light attack, heavy attack, dodge, grab, wahey, based somewhat around swiftly switching between targets mid-combo, and actually works quite well, even if it's made way too easy by the ability to make all the enemies stop fighting and give you all your health back in what I like to call the taking my ball and going home move. But the natural flow of the combat is ruined by the game trying to cram more juvenile gore into a soberly packed suitcase. The finishing moves are the worst offenders. You'd think the essence of a quick time event was that they need to be quick, otherwise they're just time events. In total, Splatterhouse has robbed something like 8 hours of my life, making me watch the same 3 or 4 overlong death animations 50 bazillion times, until I regard the shredded meat and gushing stumps with the same bored dispassion I'd use to spread jam on my croissant. And it's not enough for your guy to simply throw off an enemy grapple, he's got to also then bang their head on the floor for 5 minutes like he's rubbing his dog's nose in a clandestine turd while I nip off to bring the laundry in. The story is, you are Rick Taylor, skinny, pointless nerd who escorts his girlfriend in blissful ignorance to the house at number 31 Blood Monster Death Avenue, only to be gutted and left for dead as she is dragged off by the resident horrors. But then a mystical mask, perhaps representing some metaphor for steroid abuse, persuades him to put it on, transforming him Charles Atlas style into a socially adequate muscle-bound hunk. But as with any Faustian bargain, Rick could be worse off for it. The mask has its own agenda, whispering dark temptations into Rick's ear, promising power in return for submission, foreshadowing some inevitable conflict between, whoops, end of game, That's it. Absolutely nothing between Rick and the mask gets resolved. So it might as well have just been playing classic FM into Rick's ear the whole time for all the point the foreshadowing had. It and a momentously disappointing boss fight reek of yet another game rushing things towards the end as the deadline loomed. Seems there's an obvious way to avoid this. Make the intro first, the ending second, then everything in between. That way, if anything feels rushed or cut down, it'll be one of the bits in the middle no one cares about, while the ending is what people will remember. That's why girls will always, always love you more if you finish into their face. There's also the game's filthy habit of throwing fiddly instant death traps at us right after lengthy melees without the courtesy of a save point in between. We both know I'm awesome, Splatterhouse, stop making me prove it. On a related note are the bewildering nods to retro Splatterhouse, where the game shifts inexplicably into a 2D side-scroller, complete with irritating platforming that fits in as painlessly as a scalpel into a bell end. But this is dancing around the broad maypole of my overall criticism, which is that Splatterhouse is just desperately unpolished. Glimpses of potential painted over with caked-on layers of idle excess. Finally, fatally, it's also bugged up the butt. The sound kept dropping out. In fact, the entirety of the final boss's overlong quick-time event finishing move took place in sullen silence. If this happens to you, why not try to recreate what it was supposed to sound like by, say, feeding ravioli to your dog, or throwing wet laundry onto a tile floor, or sticking the game up your big fat ass? You know, as a child, I used to have a phobia of theme park mascots. Emotionally repressed even then, I was suspicious of their instant friendliness, fixed grins, and eagerness to take me into the gents to show me Herman the Hairy Snake, the secret mascot who only comes out for good little boys and girls with weak gag reflexes. The point is, I hadn't gotten over this problem by the time I got taken to Disneyland, and the day became a tense and fearful avoidance game at the first sign of oversized cranium, culminating in paroxysms of torment when the parade rolled around. The grins. A sea of grins. Staring. Judging. Winnie the Pooh doing some foul, perverted windmill dance with his exposed forearms. No, Goofy, I don't want to taste Herman special milk. You'll be pleased to know I have now conquered this fear, thanks in part to Epic Mickey, a game about systematically demolishing Disneyland while Mickey Mouse repeatedly falls off cliffs, whether you want him to or not. You may remember that the media started buzzing like an amorous wasp about Epic Mickey when some rather evocative concept art got sent around of an animatronic Goofy post-threshing machine, and of a ruined post-apocalyptic Disneyland implying the kind of dark, edgy, subversive reinterpretation of Disney that Epic Mickey most certainly is not. Disney, having long been as artistically bankrupt as a vending machine, care less about interesting new reinterpretations than their copyrights being depicted in the slightest negative light, so the spectre of compromise hovers around Epic Mickey, sorry, Disney Epic Mickey like a bad smell. Well-meaning funster Mickey Mouse, depicted in the intro as some kind of narcoleptic, wakes up for just long enough to accidentally release an evil blob monster upon something that closely resembles Disneyland but is never identified as such, ostensibly fucking the whole place up, but not really. You see, pseudo-Disneyland is far too magical and wholesome a place to be brought down merely by the relentless march of time or the indifferent neglect of man. It's got to be blob monsters. There's this one vintage Mickey Mouse comic in which he breaks up with Minnie and spends the rest of the comic attempting suicide. Aside. I swear this is true, and it was way edgier than this. Chip and Dale Rescue Rangers was edgier than this. Fucking Kingdom Hearts was edgier than this, if only because of the usual JRPG pedophilia subtext. Two child abuse jokes, and we've barely started. That never bodes well. The game is a hub-based action-adventure with a slightly Zelda-y, Banjo-Kazooie-y bent. Centrally, Mickey is wielding a magic brush, an edgy magic brush, with the power to create with one hand and destroy with the other, Mickey now apparently being a Hindu deity. However, the power extends only to selected background objects, bits of wall, and patches of grass. It's a gameplay mechanic specifically designed to annoy people with obsessive compulsive disorder, because while a totally created or totally destroyed level both look at least consistent, anything in between looks like absolute arse, like an unfinished jigsaw puzzle balanced on somebody's arse. The creation destruction thing ties into an ongoing moral choice system where every enemy, including bosses, can be defeated by either destroying them, the evil option, or recreating them into friendlies, which is still evil when you think about it, because it's suppressing their free will. And yes, now you come to mention it, that terrifying full face picture of a grinning Mickey Mouse they used to use at the start of Disney shorts does have a slightly Orwellian vibe to it. Now, I'm not about to say the Wii is inherently a big white clump of hardened albino snot, that's the old me, the one who lives in a cave feeding off pebbles and arrogant snorts. But every time a third-party Wii game acknowledges the motion sensor with one token Wiimote waggle control, in this case for the melee attack, it always fits into gameplay flow as naturally as a sponge at a moisture convention. And why do you think every other console controller has two analog sticks, Mr. Wii? Do you think it's just for symmetry, or because they look a little bit like nipples? No, it's because in third-person games, the camera is like the working class. If you can't control it, it will plot to destroy you. When it's not staring at the floor, it's swinging drunkenly around while you're trying to spray paint at something off to the right. The center camera button just flat out refuses to work sometimes when it feels you don't appreciate it enough. And in first person mode, you can't move, and when you spray paint, it looks uncannily like Mickey is urinating a vibrant blue liquid. Perhaps the camera issues wouldn't be so bad if it weren't for the level design. For a lot of them, it's like they got together all the pieces of the level, dropped them on the floor in a big pile, and then, I don't know, there was a bomb threat or an ice cream van drove past and everyone ran outside, and someone else came in to pick up the finished level and didn't realize the bits hadn't been put together yet. Not that there's not enough opportunity to get your bearings, I suppose. You're only going to see them all 18 million times. As is so often the case, the interpretation of epic seems to be backtrack a go-go. Before you can unlock the next level, you're required no less, to complete a few little side quests in and around the levels you've already been to. And again, as is so often the case, side quests means glorified postal service. Guy A wants something from Guy B. He'll give it if you get something from Guy C. Guy C will give it if you masturbate into his webcam for a few minutes. Multiple layers of fetch quests. It's like they couldn't be asked to think of anything else, so they just said, fuck it, we're going for niche appeal with the fetch quest connoisseur crowd. Oh yes, and to travel between levels, you have to go back and forth through these extremely little Big Planet-esque 2D platform sections every single time. It turns into a fucking commute. There's one collectible in each one as part of another fucking fetch quest, and if you're going after them, here's a gameplay hot tip. Take the upper path. They are always, always on the upper path. Maybe they're like deep sea anglerfish in that they explode if they're not at the right altitude. It occurred to me that you only ever see Mickey Mouse these days if it's in some kind of ironic context, and that led me to wonder, who exactly is this game for? I doubt kids these days have any interest in any small cartoon animal that cannot fit inside a red and white ball, and all the references to classic cartoons might as well be referencing the Canterbury Tales. If it predates Thundercats, they just don't want to fucking know. But if it's meant to be some nostalgia trip for adults, then why is it so unchallenging and toothless and about as edgy as a spherical cake in the middle of something? Despite one slightly interesting dual gameplay idea, Epic Mickey is an irritating waste of potential, like a used condom resting on your forehead. Since you should know by now that I have the Christmas week off, and you showed up anyway, I guess we're all going to be sitting in silence for the next 5 minutes while you contemplate how much you appreciate me. Oh, fine, here's some clips.
What right does War have to be angsty about his life? He's fucking War. He's never had to queue up at the job centre or pine after ex-girlfriends who left him for a surfer. He just breaks things. If I were War and I'd just hoisted a 7-foot demon into the air and chopped him in half with a single swing, I wouldn't stand there scowling. I'd go, fucking hell, did anyone see that? I am squirting machismo out of my nipples over here. I am a monster truck that walks like a man. After 2 years of this, I thought I was immune to being disappointed by games. Whoops, that's my entire opinion on Dark Void given away in one sentence, isn't it?
Off-roading around random planets is now replaced by scanning the surface from orbit, launching probes to extract resources, which is as interesting as it sounds, and it sounds like this. This is Aliens vs. Predator, though, so there are Predators too, who show up now and then to a chorus of "What the fuck was that?" from nearby human NPCs. And I'm waiting for someone to reply, "It's a fucking Predator, you moron. The human race has only encountered them like 50 times. Did no one document anything? Didn't at least one survivor put an entry on his fucking live journal?" A better name for the modern warfare thing would be Deranged Paranoid Power Fantasy for right-wing shut-ins who would blow their own nuts off the moment they were handed an actual firearm and probably already have done. Shooter. Some people have told me that FF13 gets good about 20 hours in. You know that's not really a point in its favour, right? Put your hand on a stove for 20 hours, and yeah, you'll probably stop feeling the pain, but you'll have done serious damage to yourself.
But anyway, here's Red Steel 2, and I've got to admit, this is probably the best motion-controlled combat I've seen on the Wii. Of course, it still isn't very good. It's like being the best at jerking off to your sister in the shower. You only won because no one else entered, and you probably shouldn't have been doing it in the first place.
You play the preposterously named Jack Slate, a cop so close to the edge he has to wear a safety harness, who surgically implants rare stakes into his muscles, and who missed a golden opportunity when he chose policing rather than opening a roofing business. Someone murdered his father, so he's out searching for answers, and he's letting his gun do the talking, and his gun only knows one very loud word. But I guess calling it hunter-gatherer of innocent young dinosaurs pathetically mewling their last as the memory of their mother's warmth drifts away to be replaced by the unforgiving coldness of... oh fuck it, let's just call it You Bastard. It's like a crime drama about a detective who can only concentrate when he's around pastry, so every week the crime has to conveniently take place in a bakery or within walking distance of a pie shop. And joining random online games is like walking into an aviary full of nitrous oxide and trying to play Scrabble with the kookaburras while they stand around having sex with your mum. It creates an effective contrast, like riding a bike down a long and peaceful country road and every other 100 yards the bike turns into a bear. On an educated guess though, the evil guy was probably the one with the evil moustache. And the story is focused on a small commando unit whose members spend the entire game having a prolonged who can have the noblest death competition. Oh come on, this isn't a spoiler. They wouldn't characterise this many NPCs if they weren't going to pick them off like after 8 minutes. The very first image in the game is a brief flash forward depicting your helmet lying discarded in the dust of battle-scarred terrain. What the fuck do you think happens in the end? Your character thrillingly and climactically gets a little bit hot. What I like about it is that it's a true water cooler game, and I'm not talking about all that Facebook game bollocks where you can boast to all your friends because you stuck a radish up an imaginary cow's ass.
If you said to me, sci-fi reimagining of another culture's mythology mostly concerned with robots, I would immediately think, too human, and punch you in the bollocks for reminding me of it.
So I look forward to seeing how the fanboys justify The Force Unleashed 2, because it is the most grossly offensive and mishandled application of intellectual properties.
I, in the very temple of delight, veiled melancholy has her sovereign shrine, though seen of none save him whose strenuous tongue can burst
joy's grape against his palate fine. His soul shall taste the sadness of her might, and be among her cloudy trophies hung.